But enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
There's that music I look forward to hearing every ding-dong morning. Yeah.
We got to start with something, you know.
Yeah, apparently we do. Hi.
Good morning, Opie and Anthony, Jim Norton, and you listening.
I got so lucky this week. It was one of those weeks where I had no clue what day it was because of my erratic sleep habits. So the entire day yesterday, up until I was texted on the expressway driving home yesterday, I was under the false assumption it was Wednesday. And today would have been Thursday, and I had to wait a whole nother day for Friday. And then I was informed, hey, well, at least tomorrow's Friday. And then I looked and went, oh, it's Thursday. So I like skipped the day.
You got to be the happiest man alive.
When you skip a day of the weekend, it's so much better than when you think it's Wednesday and it's Tuesday.
That stinks.
Yeah.
And it happens that way, too. So
when you realize it's not 2007.
Yeah, well, I'm still getting through that.
2007 was a nice year.
Was it?
It was all right.
I don't remember what happened in any years. I really don't. I'm just kind of like, eh, whatever. What is it now? 2009?
Yeah.
Live the moment.
877-212-ONA. You slept until... I was trying to...
Dude, this week has been some of the wackiest sleeping I've done since we had 2 years off.
But it's good. You might be in a new cycle.
I don't know.
You look well rested and...
Well, I am for the show.
But personal life.
But then, like, after the show, I try to stay up, but I'm just done by that point. And then I wind up sleeping until well after 6 p.m., it's gotten later and later, 7, 8. And then yesterday I woke up at 5, which would have been a good nap.
Home by noon,
yeah.
Sleeping by noon, up at 5.
Up at 5 in the afternoon.
That's so supposed to be a little nap.
I've slept
morning
a
guys,
lot.
Morning guys do like a noon to 1 nap.
Yeah. So that would have been like, all right, now I from 5 on until probably, you know, 11 maybe.
Easy, right?
I could do whatever
stuff.
I want.
Go shoot guns.
Right.
See how the construction's going in your house.
Whatever I wanted to do.
Maybe try to find a little Betty for yourself.
You know what I did? Betty. You know what I did?
Sorry.
A Betty. Ugh.
That's what we called them in Buffalo.
In Buffalo.
The Buffalo Bettys. It wasn't flattering, by the way,
no,
to you women out there.
Heifers.
They were the big ones. The big Buffalo Bettys, but they were... They were easy pickings.
Yeah. They tend to be everywhere you go.
A bit on the tender side, but you know what? What the hell? It's still good eats.
Good eating.
Yeah. Anyway, sorry.
So I decided when I woke up on the couch at 5,
yeah.
I decided it was time to just go to bed. So I got up at 5 in the afternoon and went to bed.
Nice.
Where I turned the TV on, put on a movie. And just fell asleep for the movie. And then I woke up at about 11:15.
What movie?
I believe I put on...
What do you do? Like, just throw HBO on or something and just go
no,
with it?
I tried going with a movie for a while. One I haven't seen since I think it was on when cable first came out. Oh. It stars James Brolin, O.J. Simpson, and... A guy that's on one of those Law and Order shows or was on one of those shows. I can't remember his name.
Towering Inferno?
No, no, no. Capricorn 1.
Oh, okay.
Where they fake the Mars landing.
Is that Farrah Fawcett and Kirk Douglas?
No.
Oh, that was...
Capricorn 1.
Does it hold up?
No.
What's the biggest problem? The special effects again?
Yeah, and just OJ being in it. I can't watch anything with OJ in it and go, ha, murderer.
Right.
it's murderer guy.
But is he a good actor?
Actor. Dude, he doesn't have a line for the first hour of the movie. He's just walking around with the other two astronaut guys.
But he's one of the main astronauts, right?
Yeah, but he doesn't talk.
But he's black.
He doesn't have a line. Well, yeah, that was like groundbreaking back then. OJ. It's like, what?
As the black astronaut.
Yeah, black astronaut.
But it was OJ. The whole country loved him.
Yeah. But, the story is fantastic. you know, they have this spaceship supposed to take off of Mars. And then at the last minute, they pull the astronauts out without telling anybody, launch the ship, use fake tapes. And the head of the program, who is, what's his name from Creepshow? Just tell him to call you Billy.
Leslie Nielsen.
No, Hal Holbrook. He was like the head of the program. And he has to tell him, look, we found out you guys wouldn't have lived. We paid, you know, the lowest bidder, and this life support system wasn't going to work. So we would have lost the whole program. It's teetering on the brink anyway. They wanted to eliminate it. So we're pulling you guys out. You guys just got to go on this set and act like you're doing this, or we're going to kill your families.
Well, great.
So they kind of do it and go through the motions, and then some of them start having second thoughts and everything like that. And then there's a malfunction.
How could you have second thoughts if they're going to say we're going to kill your family?
It was like this thing where over months, because it took months, they just started getting these second thoughts. But they went with it. Up until reentry, the heat shield separates from the capsule, and they would have been dead. So now they got to be dead.
Ah!
Now they kind of escape, and now they're running out in the desert, being hunted by
Mars being the desert,
NASA people.
Yeah,
you know, and because they have to be killed off. I won't give up the thrilling conclusion, though. Cause I fell asleep anyway, and I kind of forgot how it ended. Well, I'll watch it. You know,
look,
I don't care.
It's safe to say OJ lives. They're not going to kill OJ in the 70s.
OJ was the first to die.
Oh, they killed him.
Yeah, they made a little pact before they split up. They went in separate directions.
Yeah.
And they made a little pact before they left that if you get caught or you are ready to get killed or can't make it any further, set off a flare. And, you know, they showed the helicopters coming up to OJ, and OJ is like all, you know, he's all beaten and dehydrated, and he sets off his flare. And the other two guys kind of see in the distance like a and know, oh, well, one of them's gone.
That's the black guy rule. The black guy was always
going to show up first. Yeah.
Oh, 78.
Yeah, yeah.
You're a weirdo.
I know.
What?
Why am I watching this?
Because, I mean,
it's nostalgia.
I take that as, I guess, a weird compliment, but out of all the movies you could watch yesterday, Capricorn 1.
I've watched every movie.
You're just running out of movies? You're the guy that is running out of movies.
On cable, I watched them all. And then, like I said, on the Netflix.
Dude, I gave you. No, I didn't give it to you, but or somebody gave it to you. The Slumdog Millionaire. You've got a really good movie just sitting at your house, and you're watching Capricorn 1.
The thing is, I want to be conscious for that movie. I was really. It was one of those movies I could put on and go, I'm dozing. I don't care.
Yeah, okay.
You know, and I fell asleep. I would have fallen asleep at the end of Slumdog, which would have pissed me off.
Maybe you're not a weirdo, though. Maybe that's kind of cool. Like, well, why can't I just sit down and watch Capricorn 1 and go, oh, this movie is 30 years old. I'm going to check it out.
Yeah, it's like, and I remember seeing it. It's like popping on Westworld, one of those kind of movies, you know? Again, I think James Brolin's in that one, too.
Because I go to movies on demand, and I'm probably like the regular Joe out there. I'm so picky.
Yeah,
I'll go through every movie and go, no, 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 no. And then I get to the end, to the Z movies that are always just weird titles. And then I go, why do I even have this service? I never watch any of these movies.
By the way, every so often you got to go from Z till A. Because a lot of times you'll find something you want to watch in the upper channels and never even know what's in the, or in the upper part of the alphabet. And never know what's down there in the poor, you know.
That's my problem. Part. I make it to Z every time without finding a movie I want to watch.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're in trouble.
I'm just.
You gotta lower your expectations in sight.
That's what I'm getting at.
That's what I do. I've lowered them way down.
Hence, maybe I shouldn't be calling you a weirdo.
Capricorn 1. Give it a view.
You should give me just a list of movies that I should just watch. For no real reason. They're killing our movie in the paper today.
Oh, Taken. Wow, yeah. Jimmy
might be right on this, but they're killing Taken.
I've changed
the Liam Neeson movie.
I've started to. First, I lost confidence in my opinion.
Yeah.
And then that was enough to chip away where now I'm completely like, I think the movie sucked.
Dude, the daughter. Now, this is a visual, but this is my impression of the daughter running.
Yes, please.
Dad!
Well, they had to make it very clear that she was innocent and youthful and not ready to go to Europe on her own.
Any retard running, that was her.
She's as dumb as they come.
And her friend was a 30-year-old playing a 17-year-old. That took me out of the movie a little
troublesome
bit.
Whore friend.
Yeah, her friend, Ann B. Davis.
Right. I liked it for what it was. for what it is, a free movie.
yeah, there you
maybe
go.
I wouldn't have liked it as much if I had to pay. What are the citizens paying for a movie these days?
I don't know. A lot of money.
$12.
I enjoy a good movie that's on a DVD, and the name of it is in Sharpie. That's the movies I enjoy.
With a big "Do not copy this." Federal law states.
Whenever so often, screener copy for your consideration comes up on the bottom.
But these mother effers are getting smart.
Yeah.
How many movies have you taken home, popped in, and they say, I forget exactly how they say this, but they're basically saying, courtesy of Opie and Anthony or for Opie and Anthony. They put our names right on the screen, and you feel like, wow, I think we were part of the filming of this movie.
Because
it's kind of a credit that just keeps popping up.
It's just
for Opie and Anthony or something like that.
They can't copy it or else they'll know where it came from.
Right.
It's pretty much it.
Like, I have a side job. I'm copying these screeners and running down to Chinatown and laying them up, laying them out on a sidewalk for everybody. I mean, I don't have time to do that.
Oh. Yeah, I missed that. And then I wake up, and I guess Jurassic Park is on. And this was one of those situations where a movie that's kind of a family-type, blockbuster regular movie turns into porno, softcore porno, because I had that on. But then when I wake up for work, when the alarm goes on, and then stupid cable vision, I hate that they wind down. There's no option to stop your DVR from winding down and going into sleep mode. You'll hear the sound, but it'll say press any button to, start up your DVR again. And so I like just having the TV on, but I can't have it on when you have cable vision because it just stops in the middle of the night.
Mm-hmm.
So goddamn annoying. So Jurassic Park was on, and I fall back asleep. I wake up for work, and I'm hearing,
really?
And I can't find the remote fast enough to, get the picture. It's, covered up in my blankets, and I'm like, God damn. And I hit it, and it's one of those softcore, Emanuela kind of porno movies are on, and Jurassic Park was just on.
Some of those soft porns are...
Yeah, it was pretty good.
Very good.
And all I heard before I got the remote, all I heard was, well, what are you doing here?
Oh, really? One of those?
Naked. You're naked.
We talked
about
that.
I was like, it's a remote.
I could lend you some of my Rain CDs if you need noise to fall asleep to.
No. I need...
Would that freak you out?
I need mindless stuff. That's like...
When you're falling asleep, though, you're like, oh, wow, I'm back at my grandma's house. And I'm like 16, and I'm falling asleep, and there's a rainstorm in the distance.
I guess me thinking.
And you forget you're in a big building in the middle of Manhattan.
Gets me thinking. I'm like, economy.
That would scare you think?
Economy's bad.
Thunderstorm CDs would scare you?
No, it just gives me too much. It's not enough of distraction.
How about a beach with just waves and a couple seagulls?
Not enough distraction.
I got one of those too, and then maybe an ocean liner goes by way in the distance.
No, not enough distraction.
And then back to the wave.
Too much time.
Rainforest. I got one of those.
No, not enough distraction.
The rain gets intense though.
Unless there's wild animals.
You feel like you're under a canopy sleeping on a nice summer night. No,
it sounds nice, but
how about a little brook? With little owls in the background.
No.
I got them all. Try them out.
I need Die Hard, Gladiator, Alien, Aliens, Shawshank.
For real, I do throw these CDs in every once in a while, and if the thunderstorm, is too loud, it wakes me up. I'm like, what the F?
Dude, I slept through the T-Rex.
That's what I'm getting at. You're a good sleeper.
Doing that yell in surround sound in my room.
You're a great sleeper.
Makes for great dreams, I gotta tell you that, though. Yeah. Sometimes they creep in there, and kind of fun, but no, I need massive distractions. When I'm going to sleep.
Wow.
I just don't... I don't like just silence. I
can never sleep like that. Any little white noise, I could never go with.
I got a white noise machine now from Brookstone.
I like white noise from, the 20s.
Some marching music. I can find you some marching music. Yeah, I got a sound machine from Brookstone.
Yeah.
I got to trash him. Awful acoustics. I need a nice sound machine to fall asleep. They have white noise. They have rain and water and ocean.
Don't they have that on, your cable service?
Nah.
Like in your music channels?
Well, they got the spacey new age stuff.
That.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I got like, they wound up, you know, I sprung for the sound system in the bedroom and stuff. So a lot of times I swear I'm going to just shoot through my my balcony door in the bedroom because it sounds sometimes like
something's going on outside.
In through my door because it's surround sound. I'm laying in bed and I swear it makes it sound like something is in the room.
I can relate to that. At least in your scenario, it's possible because you only have like two floors.
Yeah.
Imagine the same scenario, but you live on the 40th floor and you are checking outside the window.
Could be Batman.
Right. I've done it. I'm like, where's that come from? It's coming from outside. I got to take a look.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, you're insane. You're 500 feet off the ground. There's nothing out there. It's impossible. I don't have outdoors.
Impossible.
I don't have outdoor space. I just have windows.
Yeah. What are they going to do?
Right.
Suction cup their way up.
But at least with you, they could possibly.
It's, it's been known to happen.
Right. Right.
You know,
right,
people have gotten in second floor windows. Of course, mine are locked and alarmed. And the second, if anybody really was there, they'd have a laser dot on their head. But yeah.
God, I can't even tell you how many times I almost just stopped over to say hi.
Everyone's
safe.
You know something? Everyone is safe if they're just stopping by. I would never do it. I hear some people that have shot through doors.
Nah, that's stupid, right?
Like, it's crazy.
That's
one guy, I get the NRA publication every month, you know, and they have the armed citizen portion at the beginning where it gives you about five or six stories of how armed citizens thwarted crime, whether against themselves or somebody else, usually against themselves. And one this month was, guy, I hear some sounds. He looks out a window and sees three guys, masks on. One of them is armed. And they're trying to bash in his front door. So he grabs his shotgun. And the second the door opened, I think he had a chain lock on it or something. It opened enough for him to... He shoved the barrel out and pulled the trigger. That's it. And he's fine.
Wow. Because,
you know, they were armed. I guess it's enough. But... Even in that situation, I think I would stand back and take some cover and wait for that door to open and 100% know what your target is. I understand, you know, he's probably very scared. He knew that they were armed. They were wearing masks. It's not like you're going to probably hit someone innocent if you just shove the barrel out the door. But, you know, to not identify that target like that is, it's a little iffy with me. I'd probably fall back. You take some cover, wait for that door to open, and then just blast the hell out of them. But
I know the difference between you and I. I would shoot everybody.
You would just start blasting the door.
I'm not even joking. That's why I don't even attempt to get a gun. I know I would be the guy that would shoot myself in the leg or something stupid.
The guys that come in and go, oh, my God, look at this moron.
Like, the self-control you have a gun is just...
It's called responsibility.
Dude, I can't even, like, get ready in the morning without giving myself a bunch of bruises and dropping things on my feet and all sorts of crap.
It's second nature to me.
I can't even imagine having a gun in that scenario that I got to work around.
Part of my ritual to just, like, you know, pop the clip when I'm leaving in the morning. You know, chick, chick.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there we go.
Are you still wearing it around the house?
No, I don't wear it around the house. I did, you know. Sometimes, though, I will just take one downstairs and kind of, like, leave it next to me on the couch.
Just in case you have an itch on your head?
Well, you know what it is? If somebody decides to just ram and kick through my door, I really don't have time to run to where the guns are.
You do know that
so
no one's going to do that,
if
right?
Do I?
Yeah.
Do I, Opie?
Yeah.
Do I?
Yeah.
Well, you tell that to somebody who it's happened to. You tell that little story that it's not going to happen to somebody that
you
probably did have it happen.
You pretty much have a cop that lives with you at this point.
What?
Let him deal with it.
No. When I'm alone or just sitting there with a friend or something like that.
Yeah.
What the hell?
All right.
You know, the gun's got to be within reach or else it's useless.
Who am I to say? I guess if you're going to have it, you should.
I have it. You can't, you know my layout. If someone kicks that door open, I ain't getting to the guns.
Do you lay guns around like people lay phones around the house?
Yeah.
So they're close to a phone at all times?
You hear a break-in. It's like when a phone rings and you go, I got one right here in the living room.
That's right.
One's in the den, one's in the kitchen. Yeah. If you hear a break-in, you're like, I'll use...
Because who needs...
Yeah, I use the .38 right. In the kitchen.
When the phone rings, who needs to go search for it, right?
Oh, See? Now you know how to think.
I'm just trying to understand a little bit.
we got to take a break. Friday.
No one else thinking. Yeah. Last Friday, we gave E-Rock the peanut butter hat.
Yes, video.
I think we need to give him another hat today. I haven't thought past the fact that we need to give him another hat today. But maybe if someone comes up with a good idea, we could give E-Rock another hat.
It's all frozen on the sidewalk at this point, and people pick it up. It's the law. I would love to. Wouldn't that be great?
And then the
dog feces hat.
Oh, wow.
Then the game could be guess where the crap ends and the head begins.
If we come up with a good hat idea, we'll give E-Rock another hat. Yeah, we did peanut butter last week, which, how high was that damn thing?
It reached all the way up to the heavens, praise his name.
Oh, no. Praise his name. Praise his name.
Praise his name.
Christian Jimmy. Did you guys try to put a bill on that hat? Hmm? Like, did you guys try to mold a...
No.
Okay, because it looked like in the video at one point you were actually trying to mold what was a baseball cap type bill.
But look at it. I mean, you know, maybe if you were here, you could have helped a little bit.
Well, I wasn't.
No, I'm just saying.
Oh, yeah, put a little cardboard.
We were just... Oh, that would have been a good idea.
A little scaffolding, you know?
No, then we try to give them like a mask, like a Lone Ranger mask.
Oh.
And that didn't work out too well. So maybe we could give him another hat today. And Ant's here, so we could really do a good one.
All right, let's find a good product.
The peanut butter was easily 8 inches off his head. Easily, if not higher. And we got lots of great stuff to do. It's going to be a good Friday show here. And Jimmy, you got tickets going on sale today?
9 this morning, my show with Artie Lang at the Tower Theater, February 21st. Tickets on sale 9 this morning at LiveNation.com.
All right, we'll continue. Opie and Anthony. I like the shock in your face, Ed. Thanks.
Well,
it's Opie and Anthony. Good morning to everybody. I was just showing off my new shoes because they're kind of famous, too, because I just wandered around New York yesterday. I bought shoes, and I'm like, well, might as well take a picture and send it to the followers on Twitter. So now they're like famous shoes, too.
Oh.
If you have a picture up on the internet and then you got that item on you, it's now famous. So these shoes are kind of famous.
Yeah.
I see you looking at those shoes. You recognize those?
I saw them on Twitter last night.
Wow.
Yeah, those are the ones.
Yeah. So now you're seeing them live.
Yeah.
How do you feel? That's got to be...
They were in the box. I saw them on Twitter last night.
I mean, I actually bought and took the picture as they're still in the box. Yeah.
Wow.
And then I had to deal with the comments that, you go to pay less and this and that.
Well, of course.
That I splurged and I spent almost $100 on my new shoes.
Perhaps more than that.
And I went with the Merrells, so, because people are wondering.
What are they?
Merrells.
Never heard of them.
Merrell? Pretty big brand.
I just know 5'11".
Oh. The other thing?
Tactical. Unless it has tactical behind it, I don't wear it.
Yeah, I understand. I got to take more pictures of you, because your pictures, they get viewed a lot by my followers.
Yes.
A lot.
Oh, my God, look at that one. That was my embarrassment picture.
Yeah, when we were playing old audio from the old days.
Yeah.
I snapped a picture of Anthony just kind of trying to disappear.
Yeah.
You almost disappeared.
I did.
Last night, I also put a picture up, and if you could find it, Dan, that would be great. Sam's father's mustache is officially on my Twitter account.
No.
Yeah, you got to see this thing.
Wow, that's worth the price of popping in right there.
Look at my God. Tell your dad to blow his nose, by the way. There's the comments I'm getting, that he's got a bunch of boogers up his nose.
Yeah.
No boogers in his nose.
Well, what the hell is going on there? It's Sam's father. For the people that don't know, Sam's father has...
Lighting up his nose.
Has an amazing handlebar mustache that he's had for, 30, 40 years?
Yeah.
He refuses to cut that thing. And I suggest the next time he takes a nap, you snip the sides on him.
Oh, wow.
Just snip the sides a little bit.
He'd be angry.
He'd be really upset.
You could tell he uses a little wax. Horrendous look. Yeah, I'm sure your father's a great guy.
He is. He's a fantastic man.
But that's a horrendous mustache.
No one does that. It's 2009.
I go, let me take a picture of just your mustache. And he was like, okay. And he started getting his mustache ready and curling up the ends.
Yeah.
No one. Yeah, it's 2009.
But then
that's
I saw
like 18. He should be on one of those bicycles with the big front wheel and the little tiny back wheel.
Holy shaker!
Yeah.
But now that I've seen my dad's mustache on Opie's Twitter, I can't wait to see him again because it's famous now.
See what happens? You're right, though, right?
Yeah.
Look at the famous shoes.
Oh my God! Those are the ones from last night.
They're right here, Sam. And then I also got a picture for you last night, Ant.
Ooh.
One of the dudes at Sirius is a big Back to the Future fan, and I can't believe I'm even mentioning Back to the Future.
Wow.
That can mean 20 minutes of, oh, my God, please make it stop radio. But with that said...
Great movie.
He's got a...
DeLorean logo.
A DeLorean logo across the back of his neck.
Why would someone do that?
He also said he used to own a DeLorean. He just really likes the movie.
And he's a young kid. He's not even that old, right?
Yeah.
I don't even think he's 30.
Wow.
He's in his late 20s. Look, there's that, and that one's for you. There you go, Ann. I put that up just for you.
Jesus.
The DeLorean logo.
What did you do to yourself? That's almost worth growing a mullet to cover that up.
Oh, wow.
Oh, I'm sorry, but...
As far as bad tattoos go, that's
pretty bad.
That's in the bad tattoo category.
It's supposed to have that chrome look to it.
Right.
And it's not coming off as chrome.
Well, you can't put it on the back of your neck either, man. You got to, like, hide that crap. And show it here. Look, check it out. And lift up your sleeve.
And it's not very symmetrical. The D and the C.
No.
Ah, it's like a prison tat.
Yeah, so.
Prisoners that love the Back to the Future series.
Yes. Yeah. So, and what I'm sending today, Anthony, it leads to today's picture.
Yes.
And boy, this is going to get some views today, my friend.
Yeah.
Anthony just gave me a picture of him wearing the fur coat.
Yes. I've done a lot of talking and bitching about the fur coat that mommy bought me because when I was about 7 years old, she bought me a fur coat because she said, hey, Joe Namath wears it.
Right.
Joe Namath wears a fur coat.
Well, wow.
It's in style. It's the fashion.
Right.
So you wear it. So I wore a fur coat to school and promptly got hit.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you're queer if you go to school and you wear a fur coat. So, yeah, there I am in my little fur coat. It's pretty much the only picture ever of me in the fur coat.
Yeah.
I'm behind my sister, Dawn.
You have the blue fur coat on.
It's like a grayish, what would you call that? Charcoal? No, I don't know what you'd call it. But it's, yeah, it's. I'm in the background, kind of, behind Dawn, next to my mother, and my brother is way off to the right of the photo. And, yeah, that's me, little me, in my fur coat.
You look like Joe Namath.
Just like him. That was the thing. Like when my mother decided I should wear a fur coat. Wonderful.
And
send.
Send to the followers.
There it is.
Opie Radio on Twitter.
Let it rip.
Having fun with the Twitter.
I am pimping in that. You're right.
You are pimping.
I said that.
Yeah, Dawn looks like a guy in that picture. Like a you know.
Dawn looks like a little boy.
Like you Joe all look like little boys. Girl.
Joe looks like Nancy McKeon, who's Joe from The Facts of Life.
Yeah.
That's who
a Joe.
Like.
Or a very young Robbie Benson.
Yeah,
he
a little
also
bit.
Has a Robbie Benson look to him. I just look like some little fruit. And, yeah, Dawn looks like a little boy.
Nah, you guys look like some hip European family.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like you guys live on a yacht and you're just visiting America, visiting your American relatives or something. There's nothing American about that picture.
And we don't know anything about fashion in this country.
Nah, it's like cool where you're from type of thing, you know?
That picture taken also in my, a little trivia for the picture.
Yeah.
In my grandmother's house, where we still go to this day for Christmas. For a Christmas Eve dinner and Thanksgiving dinner.
Nice.
No, the velvet raised little things on the wallpaper.
Mm-hmm.
See, if you look in the back, you see that little thing?
Man. Oh, wow.
That was raised green velvet on the wallpaper, by the way. Oh, not too wop to have in your house. Yeah, that's gone. That's long gone.
And this picture is also on your Facebook, so.
Yeah.
Which you can't even keep up with anymore.
I've been trying, but I think
it gets crazy.
I think I'm teetering right about $5,000 as far as friends go. So once I hit 5,000.
Why doesn't Facebook make it more than $5,000?
I think they're trying to keep it, you know, where it was your real friends.
Well, no one has 5,000 friends, though.
With, you know, other sites that...
But see, the cool thing with MySpace, it's all about the numbers. So you're sitting there like, wow, look at me. Well, it's all fake friends and stuff, but it's cool to watch the numbers go up.
I topped out.
You don't want to top out with these network
sites.
It
could be like Call of Duty, though. Once you top out, just cash it all in.
You should start over.
And, yeah, what do they call that? When you do that in Call of Duty, you get to the top rank, and then you just cash it all back in again. And start from scratch.
Know what you should do?
I might do that. Prestige, yes. To go through the prestige phase of my...
You know what your goal should be?
I have 4,342 friends.
But, Ant, this is your goal. You're going to get 5,000.
I'll hit 5 today.
Well, you could have it already if you'd like kept up with it.
I only have like.
Then start knocking out the dudes and be the first person on Facebook that has 5,000 chicks.
All the
that would be cool.
All the guys are starting to get when I actually make them one of my friends. They're starting to go, oh, I can't believe I got in before you start kicking guys out to just get girls.
Because that's what's going to happen.
That
next.
Is kind of a cool goal. I'm going to go through and just like knock off a few guys, and then wait for just girls to come in, and then I'll just pop them on, knock out a few more, and try to get 5,000 girls exclusively. Just
and then
girls.
When you get 5,000 girls. Then you drop it to 5,000 girls under 30.
No.
Start with under 30.
Just go with anybody.
Just hot?
And then hot. And then start dropping out down the ages where you just hot teen girls, 5,000 of them.
Is there any way to find out how many guys you got on Facebook and how many girls?
Oh, it's ridiculous.
It's got to be all guys because that's our number one demo, unfortunately.
I probably have 5% girls to 95% guys. As far as friends go.
I mean, you know, the guys keep us working, but come on.
Keep us in $100 sneakers.
That's nothing, though. Everyone's paying almost $100 for shoes these days.
Of course.
All right. E-Rock. Last week, we did a peanut butter hat.
I thought we were playing a game. I was going to go fat, stupid. we're doing like
lazy, late to work.
The password is Blue Whale.
God, and he does everything for us as far as these.
Does he?
He's never said no to any of the things we ask of him. Well, last week, Anthony, Jimmy and I gave him a peanut butter hat because of the salmonella. So that was our little excuse to make E-Rock wear a peanut butter hat, which was quite large, about eight inches off his head, and then he went outside, and people were, like, just mad at him.
Yeah, why wouldn't you be?
And then the dude downstairs goes, I get it, Slumdog Millionaire, right?
Yeah.
And I didn't even see Slumdog Millionaire at that point, and then I did see the movie, and I'm like, wow, it's the exact same color as when the kid fell into the outhouse. Anyway, we've decided that we need to give E-Rock another hat today.
Yeah.
But we're starting to think Fluffernutter. So where's the E-Rock? Is he around?
Someone on.
Or we could give him a.
I'll talk has a good one. A Nair hat.
No, Stunt Brain did that one already.
Oh
no.
That hat.
I'm oh, hurt. Boy. Why? E-Rock. Actually, Sam, the real reason why Sam is in here, because he brought it to my attention. We went off on a little tangent there, Ant. But Sam might have a choice that E-Rock can make right here.
Well.
Maybe. I mean, it's up to the rest of you guys.
Our new intern, Paul, has brought in an item that he has had with him because he says he wants E-Rock to put it on.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. It is an adult-size Wonder Woman costume. It's a onesie, so the legs are exposed.
Oh, God. Oh, no.
Does it have the wig?
I don't know if it... No, it does not have the wig, but this is
perfect,
have the,
by the way.
It has the little Wonder Woman head tiara thing.
But it does have the tiara, he's telling me.
Okay.
And he thinks, does intern Paul, that E-Rock would look very nice in it.
Okay.
Well, the cunning linguist is saying E-Rock has the boobs for it, so let her rip.
E-Rock, would you wear the Wonder Woman outfit today?
Well,
give you a Fluffernutter hat?
He said there was a choice.
Yeah, the choice is do it or you're fired.
Oh, look at that.
That choice.
Thing.
That choice stinks.
what kind of choice do you think we're going to give you? We're doing both today.
You just got Sophie's choice.
Do it or you're fired.
Oh, my God. Look at that.
Wonder Woman costume. No.
Look at it.
Oh, is that embarrassing?
I'm more creeped out that the intern the has boots? One of these.
Those are the
Oh,
boots.
You got the boots and everything, E-Rock. Will he fit in this thing?
Tiara?
Yes, he will.
Oh, he has to.
Sam, would he fit? It stretches, yeah. E-Rock.
I'm not worried about the width. I'm worried about the length.
It stretches that way, too.
Yeah, come on, E-Rock.
Yeah.
It's all about the one. What?
Hey, by the
you
way.
You wore it already?
What do you got? What do you wear? Have that for?
Yeah,
I could step up to a mic.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah.
I wore it to a friend's superhero party.
Oh,
superhero party. I think any guy that does that for Halloween or a party and dresses like a girl has some kind of an issue. I just do. I think if a guy does, any guy that dresses like a woman for Halloween has some kind of issue.
I don't know.
How about if said guy does it, I don't know, in January? Perhaps.
All right, that's even more of an issue.
That's just kind of funny.
Yeah.
Look, girls.
Hysterical.
Well, sometimes I want to feel pretty too, Ant.
All right.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong about
nice long locks for it, so sure.
And the big burly beard.
Yeah.
Guy looks like a trucker.
This is like a big John Studd if you're a tranny.
Yeah. Yeah. Oof. All right, E-Rock, what do you say?
It's visual.
We want you in the Wonder Woman costume and then possibly a Fluffernutter hat today.
Yeah.
E-Rock, if it makes your decision easier, there is built-in wiring for support.
Oh, good, an underwire? Might need that.
All right, E-Rock, get to it.
God, baby.
No, guys that go to Renaissance fairs, all man.
Huh?
I'm commenting on people that say, what about guys who go to Renaissance fairs? And I haven't been to one since, you know.
Since now you don't like them anymore,
break
right?
Up. Well.
You used to love them, but now you don't, right?
I enjoyed the beer, you know, the big turkey leg.
You don't like them anymore?
I probably won't go unless, you know, find someone fun to go with.
Mm-hmm. You'll find someone fun to go with.
Will I?
Yes.
I hope so. I got a sword and everything.
When is the Renaissance Fair?
It's at the end of the summer.
Cool.
Up in Tuxedo, New York.
You know what, my brother's?
That's the New York
I lost interest already.
All right.
My brothers went this past season. They freaking thought it was the coolest thing ever.
Yeah.
I went a long time ago in Rochester. I threw the axes.
See, that's what it is. You got to get hammered and throw the axes and the stars.
Like darts over your head. I loved it. What's wrong, E-Rock? He's got a problem already.
It's
What?
It's bad enough I got to do this, right? And I'm willing to do it. But to go back into the office and have Steve going... Why don't you ever say no to this?
What's wrong with Steve?
What?
Bring Steve in.
All right, Steve, you're putting on the costume. Oh, he wouldn't fit in that.
Why would you encourage our people to say no to stuff?
I didn't encourage him. I just said, why don't you ever say no? Just out of blatant curiosity. I understand that, Eric. It was a question. You don't have to get all emotional about it. It was a question.
Because did you ever know that Opie's his hero?
I know. Believe me. Trust me. I've thought of that many times.
Opie would tell Iraq anything.
Yeah, I know. Believe me.
It's documented that he's a hero. You still got it up there?
No, that's long gone.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Oh, wow. Oh,
showed
wow.
Me.
You sure did.
You were crying like me until I was 20.
All right, E-Rock. Go put on your Wonder Woman costume. And then we're going to give you a Fluffernutter hat.
Also, we're coming in to just make him Hoagie Girl.
Oh, this is the Hoagie Girl costume.
Hoagie Girl.
Actually, yeah, why don't we make some adjustments to the costume and turn it into Hoagie Girl?
Blunder Woman. Adult. There he goes. Yeah, go into the bathroom to change it so you got some pride and privacy and dignity.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. We're going to get into some material. It's Friday. We're trying to screw it off a little bit, but there's a lot of things happening in the news.
Can I say I'm liking Obama a lot today? He annoyed me yesterday.
You hated him yesterday.
And I didn't hate him. He really annoyed me.
Yes, on his foreign policy.
I'm loving him today.
Hold that point, and we'll find out why Jimmy's loving Obama. I think that's the type of thing that's going to happen.
Did he resign?
No. Okay. You're going to like him one day. You're going to not like him the next. I mean, he's very controversial.
Still waiting for that day to come about for me.
Oh, no, you're a lost cause. I do want to ask you one question about Obama, though, sometime this morning.
Okay.
What is it going to, it's very easy. Maybe you can think about it during the break. Mm-hmm. What is it going to take for you to like Obama?
Right.
Very open-ended question. I understand that.
Okay. Impossible.
What is it going to take?
Take the good half and double it.
What if he told you never have to pay taxes again? Would that be enough for you to like Obama? Don't answer now. Answer after the break.
Because
we're running late.
All right.
But I do want to know that today. FU line. We're going to do that for everybody because it is Friday. Do they need time or can we just play it?
I can come right now.
No, I'm playing it.
All right.
All right, we'll be back in just a bit. It's Opie and Anthony. Here is the FU line.
Thanks for calling the Opie and Anthony FU line. Here's the latest batch of FUs.
You have 9 new voice messages. First voice message.
Yeah, I'd like to give a big fuck you to Al Gore. Oh, look out for global warming. It's coming. It's coming. Well, how come it's 12 degrees every morning when I fucking wake up instead of the normal 30 degrees it is every other fucking winter?
I hate you. Go fuck yourself.
Next message.
Hey, I want to give a big, giant fuck you to the stupid, stupid lady that bought my couch from my yard sale yesterday for $7 fucking, and I delivered it to her damn house, and she didn't even fucking pay me the $7. Fuck you.
Next message.
Yeah, I wanted to say fuck you to the DOT. You guys are nothing but fuck stains on the sheet of humanity.
Next message.
I just want to give a big, fat fuck you to my former boss. All the while you were telling me how you expect big things and great things out of me for the next coming year, and all the while you knew that 2 weeks later I was going to get laid off. So fuck.
Oh, man, we're excited. E-Rock's putting on his Wonder Woman costume for everybody.
Ah.
And then we're going to give him a Fluffernutter hat. How old are we? Opie and Anthony, 877-212-ONA. Just before the break, Jim Norton was saying that he's loving Obama. Now, sounded like you were a little irritated with him yesterday.
Yeah, I think you're right. You said it. It's going to be a love-hate thing, like with his foreign policy, with Muslim countries. I think he's going to annoy me. Yeah. Guantanamo annoys me, but he is Wall Street's worst nightmare. These vultures, he's their worst nightmare. Where he's talking about the fact that these guys are getting bonuses in this, where the toilet economically.
Yep.
And a couple of things that I think really push people to the brink, which is Bernie Madoff, this face that they can put on.
Yeah.
Hating.
The new moron out there on Long Island, too. There's another one that
bilked
a bunch of people out of money.
A couple hundred million, I think.
Mm.
And then there's the city jet, the city core jet, whatever it was. And he's just saying that's the height of your responsibility. It's shameful. Which are kind of harsh words coming from the president.
Talking about the voters?
Oh, don't be so fresh. But he's talking about things like that. And Senator Chris Dodd, he's a Connecticut Democrat, of course. He heads up the Senate Banking Committee. He vowed at a Capitol press conference to seek return of the bonuses. Now, I don't know if they're going to get that.
Yeah.
Hell no, they ain't.
But the
that.
Fact that they may put such pressure on these companies, where if you got a bailout and you still gave out bonuses, I'm hoping they threaten to take the bailouts back. The fact that a company would give a guy a bonus after getting bailed out is just, it's like, we're just a bunch of suckers as Americans. We're a bunch of dummies. And people are, they said it's like at an all-time high how much people really hate corporations and hate their corporate mentality.
Yeah, yeah, well, you know, when it's business as usual in this kind of economic problems with the economic problems that we're in right now. Ugh, you know, you can't have these guys with these multi-million dollar bonuses after they're getting bailed out. I mean, that's, you know, that's not the, everyone thinks, oh, it's the government's money and you shouldn't do that. No, it's your money. It's the country's money. Yeah. It's the people's money. And it was given to you thinking you're going to be responsible with it. And then you just keep doing the same mistakes that put you in that situation in the first place. It's ridiculous. It's like you're a parent with a stupid kid that keeps doing the same, making the same mistake. Send him to that stupid Sylvan Learning Center.
Go learn something stupid.
The president responding to a new report that revealed bank execs approved more than $18 billion in bonuses last year. Now, this was as the government forked over billions in bailout funds. President Obama says that this is not the time for big payouts.
They have to start acting in a more responsible fashion if we are to together get this economy rolling again.
Steve from Bayshore.
What did he say?
Hey, where's half a Thunder Woman? Goddamn, Steve.
Half a Thunder Woman.
Nice.
And I know Steve is celebrating today. I
want to
wish Steve a happy. I don't know.
What Nazi birthday is it?
Well, no, in 1933, Adolf Hitler was appointed Chancellor of Germany. So for Steve, I think it's a big day. I just want to say happy Hitler is Chancellor Day.
He's a big fan of the era.
And he says, thanks, Ant. He's a big fan of the era like I am.
Yeah.
He's the guy that, he's my go-to guy now as far as memorabilia goes.
Mm-hmm.
Like if I need memorabilia from the era, which I like to call it, the era.
He knows where to go to get it.
Yeah, he knows what's legit.
Nice.
What's like fake stuff that people are trying to pawn off as real.
Sure.
So he's the guy. I'm going to have to take him along when I go, visit Germany as a little tour guide.
Because
he knows everything about everything. You know, from the era.
Hey, your boy Hannity got blasted by Stewart.
What?
Maybe we can find the audio, according to Fast Freddy. John Stewart smashed Sean Hannity last night. Good
How
stuff.
Do you smash
Worth
him?
Getting. And I like Hannity. Fast Freddy's saying he likes Hannity, but Stewart smashed him. Mm-hmm. That's a nice little battle right there.
Well, all right. I'd have to hear it. Ew, the Pink Panther is ringing the bell on Wall Street.
Oh, Jeremy, look.
And it's for the Pink Panther, too.
Oh, that's funny. They should open a casket and violate and then dump out a body. And then Steve Martin should point at it with his phony black wig and go, look, we have made it ours now. We have made it ours. He should be thrown in jail for spending what is stolen money. He stole that character.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't get to the phone calls yesterday, but we talked about the Pink Panther and some of the younger demos were called younger demos. Yeah, some of the younger listeners were calling in saying, hey, those movies are hilarious. Everyone in my high school loves them.
Yeah.
But the problem we have being older is the fact that the younger listeners have no clue where that comes from the most part.
Yeah.
That it was done brilliantly by a guy named Peter Sellers, who most people have forgotten at this point.
I saw the first one. It wasn't funny. I watched it. It's just corny.
Yeah.
It was a cornball movie. But if you're in high school, of course I would laugh at that if I was in high school.
But that's where our frustration comes from, you know? Yeah, go invent a new character and make it funny and make it your own.
Yeah, you're a comedian, man.
Good luck.
You're a comic.
Yeah.
You're supposed to be original and creative, and you're just redoing comedies.
Mm-hmm.
You suck, Steve.
Let's say hi to Tim in Pennsylvania. Tim, you got something for Jimmy?
Well, yeah, I'm not really mad at him, but he said before, I'm so proud of Obama that he, whatever he said.
I said, hold on, dude, I didn't say I'm so proud of him, like he's my nephew. I said, I'm happy that he's taking this stance in this particular case.
Yeah.
But he's doing the same thing by wanting Congress to sign up in the stimulus package, which is so full of pork, so full of irresponsible spending. You know, these Wall Street guys, half of their money sometimes comes from these bonuses.
Now, that is true. I was going to bring it up, but a lot of these guys don't have giant salaries.
I understand that.
It's based on performance,
sure.
Which I don't know how they make a bonus based on performance in this day and age.
Right.
But, I forgot what company it was, but the guy went from a salary of well over $10 million. He cut his salary back to $10,000 a year. And he's just bonus-based.
Okay. Well, if the bottom line, I don't know how it works on every case, but I will say, if the country is bailing you out with billions of dollars,
right,
and you're an executive and you're getting a bonus,
yeah, you don't deserve
there's
it.
There's something wrong with that.
You made a mistake somewhere if your company is in that position.
And I think there's, I understand about the pork barrel thing. I don't disagree with you, man. You're right. But that doesn't mean
you admit you're wrong.
I don't, no, it's not about being wrong.
Oh, my God, he just throws that out at you.
No, but it's just, I know I won't because, because I'm really not. I still like the fact that he did that. I can like that and not like the pork thing. There's not a gun to my head going, make a decision, bucko.
Well, we're looking at the stimulus package a little deeper, and the latest is $150 million for honeybee, what?
Insurance.
Honeybee insurance.
What's the honeybee insurance all about?
Hey,
and how does that stimulate the economy?
Dying.
Two honeybees, they come to an intersection, one clips the other one.
Well, there's a problem with the bees. They're dying.
I'm going to steer clear from animal jokes. Look at the Pink Panther and is now behind.
Oh, he's now on Channel 11 News.
That's a man in an outfit. Is that a real panther?
it should rip their heads off.
Why does somebody in an outfit, what he's doing, he's putting his arms up just like a retard dancing.
Yeah, anytime you get in a big kind of a...
shaking, like trying to be cute.
Furry mascot type costume, you got to act like a queer.
Dude, how much would you love to see somebody, like it's a bus in Jerusalem, just run on with a bomb strapped to them and tackle stupid panther.
You just see shards of fur.
Get him in here.
Nails all over.
Get him in here. I'll rip the head right off the guy and then stomp it to death.
And
no problem.
Wonder Woman down there.
Is Wonder Woman ready to make her appearance or what?
Yeah, where's Wonder Blimp? Get her in here.
Are we almost ready? So the honeybee insurance, the bees are dying, and the scientists have no idea why.
Bees, they're
and
dying.
I guess bees are very important to our survival or something. I don't know.
To the food.
I saw it on the Discovery Channel once.
Is this going to create jobs?
Yeah, how does it create jobs there, Stunt Brain?
Yeah, this is what Jack Cafferty was going off on this yesterday, saying, how is this going to create jobs?
But he's a curmudgeon.
Yeah, he is.
We kind of like him, but he's a
crumb. And let me tell you something. You could twist and pervert any money that goes to anything to it'll create jobs. You could BS your way through anything and say, well, this, 8 degrees of separation, and you have a job. We're talking a stimulus package that in an emergency situation where it's supposed to stimulate the economy quickly.
What's the way of doing this? What is the way of doing it? Is it just getting like jobs and stuff like construction, or
you know something? Yeah, things like that. Well, or how about?
How do you know this doesn't help get jobs?
Honeybee insurance?
Yeah. How do we know? What are they saying about the honeybee?
How long have you been traipsing this earth? I know I've been around for 44 years.
40 years.
I've never known a beekeeper. I've never known anyone that knows a beekeeper.
Supposedly, they're very important to our food supply.
Yeah.
So maybe if you insure the bees, then maybe some of these companies won't go out of business.
How is insuring the bees?
I don't know.
We're bringing in the Australian bees.
That's always good when we bring other animals over from other countries. It always works well 50 years later.
Yeah. Someone has an idea to put a little fish in water to eat some algae.
Africanized honeybee?
What's the shell one that is pretty much destroying?
Oh, the zebra mollusk?
The zebra mollusk.
Yes.
Look that thing up. Yeah. Destroying the Great Lakes.
What? The zebra mollusk is...
completely destroying the Great Lakes.
Introduced to the Great Lakes, and it's...
They introduced it, and it decided to just eat everything, and it has no predators, and, you know, somebody didn't figure that one out. And they don't know what the F to do.
What does a zebra mollusk do?
It just takes over everything in sight.
Wait, is that a cluster of them?
Yeah.
Wow.
And we do this all the time when we introuce animals into this country.
Yeah. They bite people?
I love your childlike little questions. Do they bite people?
No, they're like a clam, basically. Like a mussel.
Clam.
Not like clams. Clams don't multiply. How great would that be? They multiply like ivy up the side of your wall.
A cluster of them is on your bedpost.
Yeah. They look like punched wax lips.
They're just a complete pain in the ass. And what's that other animal we introduced that it's a fish that walks out of water and eats your dog and then goes back in, and they don't know what the F to do with those things?
Your dog.
I
think it's called some kind of dogfish.
I think that was a movie. I have to look that one.
No, it's some kind
of... No, there is a
Japanese something.
But the kudzu vine was not supposed to be here, and look what it's done to the south.
Don't act like we all immediately understand what the kudzu vine did.
That kudzu vine is what you see growing all along the side of the road in the south, and it wasn't a native plant. Somebody brought it in, and suddenly...
And what is it doing?
It's just overgrowing and taking over the natural vegetation, which is bad for the ecosystem. Same way that Africanized honeybees are now ripping up the south.
Well, they're killer bees.
They're fine.
Yeah.
They got insurance.
According to Kyle in Texas, Einstein once said, when bees die... we die.
Did he really say that?
Yes. The bees are extremely important, and they are going away.
What do you have
Kyle,
to
go
bees?
Ahead. I already
bees
said...
Go, we... No, he said, as bees go, we go. And, like, the big problem is out west, there's a giant bee guy or whatever, and he sells those to huge farmers and crops, cross-pollinate all kinds of produce and goods. And the pesticides are killing... whatever it is that trains the bees to get back to their hives. What? So it kills like their nervous system, and it's like pesticides versus bees.
They haven't identified that yet, sir. The collapsed colony disorder, they first were blaming on cell phone towers, and now they're trying to see if it is related to a pesticide.
Cell phone towers?
Yeah, because they sell signals. The bees transmit signals. That's how they direct each other.
We have enough the bees because we need to make our phone calls.
Yeah, we need to text.
We need a text.
That's, oh my God.
That's hilarious.
Whenever you hear a buzzing in your phone.
Yeah. It's the bee.
It's the bees.
Oh my God.
Well, this guy's getting attacked by bees. Listen to him.
Hey, and Anthony, you know, one of your favorite Republican senators of Utah is probably happy about that $150 million.
Yeah.
They have, like, a giant bee laboratory out there in northern
Utah. Laboratory.
Sure.
All right.
All right, thanks, Kyle. Your phone just sucks. Call back anytime.
I'm not that educated on the bee problem, to tell you the truth.
It's kind of scary.
When I was drinking some beers out by my hot tub last summer, there were bees all over the place.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Remember that?
No.
Bees everywhere.
Bees? Yeah. No, there was a seal when I was in your pool.
You're saying it was a little chilly.
I didn't see any bees. Nothing. I saw me in an overcoat.
Jimmy's ice fishing.
Yeah, it was awful. Exactly.
I finally figured it out. When the weather gets nicer, you're cordially invited to come into the scalding hot, hot tub.
Dude, this explains my text message. I was talking to a girl. I'm like, what are you wearing? And she wrote back, same joke. Not as good as the second.
You're not quite as good.
Phone off. Put phone down.
Will someone help me out with the fish that walks out of the water and does horrific things and then goes back in the water and they can't kill these things?
Yeah.
It's called the walking fish or the snakehead. Let me go to Eddie on Long Island.
Snakehead.
Eddie.
Yeah, I was just calling to tell you it's a snakehead. I just heard it, though.
It's not a land shark.
Well, what does the snakeheads do for real? Maybe they don't eat your dog.
No, they can actually live out of water for like 3 days, and they can they crawl across the land and go. They can move to each like lake or any kind of body of water.
Would that be able to live in water?
So that's the problem. It pretty much has no predators and it eats everything, right, Ant? So you think you could contain them to one little like lake or pond? But they say f that. I'm getting out of the water and I'm walking somewhere else
walking around,
and then I'm going to populate that area.
How big are they?
That's it. There's nothing to eat left in that lake, so they move to the next one.
Yeah,
they call them frankenfish. Now I remember it.
Frankenfish.
Yeah, they call them the frankenfish.
They brought them over from Japan.
It's a pit bull with fins, one article
described. How do they go from... Where's their little feet?
They just walk.
The lower fins.
They walk on their fins.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're like, kind of like slither along the ground.
They're like what evolved and came out of the water.
Yeah.
Just there now.
How do they know where to go? Like, how do you not just find these dead things in a parking lot somewhere headed towards a Macy's? Would they know where the next lake is?
I don't know. It's a good question,
they
Jimmy.
They can't find his way to the lighthouse and eat our new friend there, huh?
Wait, what do they do if there's a big rock or a wall?
Mm-hmm.
Where they turn around and go, all right, back we go.
Back to the lake.
Back to the lake.
I'm going
to
do.
Little fish sneakers. I'm going to open a fish sneaker stand and make a bloody fortune.
They've actually drained small lakes that they suspect they're in in efforts to try and kill them off.
Yeah. Good luck.
Are they that bad?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're not good.
Why don't they just hang outside with a mallet and wait for them to wander out?
Yeah.
And just smash them.
Yeah, I don't know. What's it look like? If it's a fish and it's behind a tree looking at you, get it.
Yeah, odds are that's your guy.
You have to drain the thing. Hey, if you see a fish on 2 feet, that's the guy.
Why don't we do some research on the, what is it called? The snakehead. Tell me why they're a problem. And also the zebra mollusk. All right.
By the way, on the news.
A word I've never been able to say. Mollusk.
The weather's happening. And the Pink Panther.
Oh, look at that, Jimmy.
Is trying so hard to be cute and dancing across the screen cutely.
Yeah.
You're getting that face, yeah, like you're a little embarrassed for it.
I am very embarrassed for it. I ugh.
How great would a piece of that pink skull look coming off the back of a limo in Dealey Plaza?
You just should never redo really good comedies.
Sure. No.
We've discussed this many times. There's movies that should be remade because the technology gets better, what have you, mostly for special effects.
Friday
and things
the 13th.
Like that.
There.
But, yeah, right, well. But they redid The In-Laws, which was an amazing comedy, and that stupid movie, The In-Laws, sat on the shelves for years, and they finally put it out. It was a disaster.
Yep.
But Peter Falk and what's his name were great in the original.
Arkin. Alan Arkin.
Yeah, Alan Arkin, sure. All right, why don't we take a break? Is E-Rock ready?
E-Rock!
And is, well, not... Oh, he's in the bathroom waiting.
Why is he taking time? Why are the boots out here?
Yeah, give him the boots. He just peeked his head out. Oh, my God.
Give him everything. He's got to put everything in it. And see, give him the little padded bra thing.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Everything.
Everything.
Everyone!
Don't come out yet. The big reveal after the break. I just saw a little glimpse of him. Oh, my
God. Put those boots on.
Get the Pal Talk cameras next to the bathroom. We'll be taking video and snapshots. But E-Rock is going to come out in his Wonder Woman costume, and then we're going to make a Fluffernutter hat on him. Trying to keep the hat bit going, I don't know.
The hat.
Opie and Anthony. You're checking out the Opie and Anthony Show Friday, heading toward the weekend. We couldn't be happier. Jimmy's got tickets going on sale. I know that's going on.
My show at Artie Lang, February 21st, goes on sale 9 a.m. this morning at the Tower Theater in Philadelphia.
Ooh.
LiveNation.com. It's me and Artie doing our first little show together.
This morning?
We're not performing this morning. We're doing February 21st.
I didn't think you were performing this morning. That would have been short notice and you're doing a show.
That would be crazy, yeah.
Who'd come? People are working.
Tickets are going to go real fast on that one.
I hope so. That would be fun, though, to book a show at this hour and then have like 11 people show up to this last minute. We announce it 4 minutes before we do it.
Give it a try. You never know.
Oh, you do.
Something different.
We're about to do the big unveiling of E-Rock in his E-Rock. Wonder Woman costume before we give him the Fluffernutter hat. You can tell it's a Friday, right?
Is Opant 2 working? So we have a two-camera shoot.
Yeah, let's do the two-camera shoot for the people that are watching the radio show.
Sorry. Yeah.
All right, he's working on that. In the meantime, it's a quickie, but thank God he's finally out, because I don't feel like trying to figure out how to say his name. That governor in Illinois, Blagojevich.
Blagojevich?
Blagojevich, right.
Blagojevich.
I hate those names where you have to really think before you attempt it.
A J and a G and a Vich. It's like, get a hold of yourself.
It should just flow off your tongue.
Yeah.
But he's done. 59, 52. 59 nothing. Shut out. He's done.
Not one guy.
He is a lunatic, man.
They not only threw him out 59 nothing, they also took a second vote to ban him for life. And the Illinois politics. And
you know, when the vote got to 25 nothing, they should have stopped it.
You think?
You're right. You know, it's just unfair. It's mean.
Ugh. This is why the guy is completely insane. If he would have resigned, he would have had a chance to get back into politics down the road.
This probably would have come up, though.
Good point.
I think the opponent would have brought it up.
But at least it would have gave him a shot at maybe going back into politics. They not only said, get lost, stupid. We don't want you in politics anytime soon in this in this state.
He resigned in shame for trying to sell a Senate seat. Is this the man you want as your, like,
I guess,
assemblyman?
Yeah, I guess.
He's got to work himself back up.
I guess you're right. I guess he was in a bad spot no matter what. But listen
Comptroller.
Listen how he talks. I think we all have one of these people in our lives. They just talk around. Like, what do they call that when you just talk around?
Evasive, very evasive.
Double talk.
Double talk is another one, sure. Yep. Don't answer the question.
There hasn't been a single piece of information that proves any wrongdoing. You haven't proved a crime, and you can't because it hadn't happened. You haven't given me a chance to disprove a crime, but so far a crime has not been proven here in this impeachment proceeding. How can you throw a governor out of office with insufficient and incomplete evidence?
That's like, all well and good.
Like this, dummy. Yeah, right. Just like this. Goodbye.
But he had his chance there. So, tell us why, instead of saying you don't have anything on me.
I'd love to see that speech that he just gave, and then you cut to the front door, and you just see him fly out, and you hear, and stay out!
Hurrah, hurrah, hurrah.
How can you do that, and all of a sudden you see 59 hands, and the yeas have it?
Yeah.
I see, that's how.
Ah, okay, at least you showed me.
You vote, and I go.
Comes down here to New York to do all that press when he had some big problems at home there.
Yeah.
How about you to deal with what's going on in Illinois, and then not worry about getting on The View with Barbara Walters?
Ugh. He loves the public eye, man. He loves yapping. He talked a little too much and sounded a little too crazy.
Well, he'll get a book.
Yeah, oh, he'll get a book
he'll
deal.
Get a little book deal happening.
Movie.
But then what? All right, what are we waiting for? We
Let's get her out here.
Yeah, let's get E-Rock. Big reveal. Our intern, what's his name?
Paul.
Paul brought in his Wonder Woman costume because he went to a superhero party, right? And, well, we said, E-Rock, you got to put the Wonder Woman costume on. So, without further ado, here comes Fatso.
Ah!
Oh, my God.
You suck!
Hey, at least he's playing it up, man.
Wait a minute.
E-Rock
did
the Wonder Woman pose and everything.
Why is he wearing his boxers underneath that?
Is that your boxers? All right, go back
all
in.
Right, back
all
right, in.
All right, stop the
back
music.
Back in.
What are you doing?
Back in. What are you doing?
Back in.
Thank you, Jimmy, for noticing.
Back in.
Killing the sex appeal.
Yeah. Go back in the bathroom and take the boxers off.
Don't cheat.
Yeah, what are you doing, E-Rock? What the hell's wrong with you? You just wrecked the whole moment.
There you go.
No.
No, no. Yeah, I guess so.
All right.
He looks like an old school wrestler.
Yes.
I'm trying to remember just one to make the joke better. Like Bruno Sammartino.
Look how horrible he looks in that getup.
There, E-Rock, come on over here.
He's spreading his cape.
Yeah, he's doing the pose and everything for everybody.
Ding, 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 ding.
We'll have pictures up on onaradio.com in a little bit.
Able to leap zebra mollusks. Look, on the floor at the buffet.
Oh, he's got his lariat of truth.
Oh,
his little lasso of truth there. You got to watch out.
And then, give me the good pose, all right? All right, he's going to... We're all taking pictures for our... Oh, God. Hold on. Oh, you're just awful.
And instead of Wonder Woman's invisible plane, he has an invisible compilation of work.
All right, now
put the lasso of truth around yourself and tell us what you ate.
Does he have enough padding?
Thanks. He just goes, thanks.
What else is he going to say?
He's dressed like that. Look at the real one. Danny just popped up a picture of Linda Carter in her heyday as Wonder Woman. And then we look at this. Oh, are you a mess? I'm the after
shot. you're the after shot. Of course, I can't take a picture. I can get all these pictures off my phone.
How are you supposed to twit?
He's got his little... What's the matter? What's the matter?
Yeah, what's up, B-Rock?
What's going on with the pads?
The wiring is cutting my bosom.
Oh, the wiring is cutting into your... well, now you know how the women feel. See?
Hey, give me the pose again.
That's a colorful little outfit.
I need another pose.
You look silly, Rock.
Yeah, silly's a good word for it.
All right, here's the... All right, hold on. God,
he spreads his arms apart so the cape is flowing. He puts his head up and... he puts his head to the side and looks up like... I don't know.
For justice.
For justice, yes.
If there was any justice, you'd fly out that window and hit the pavement.
I know that'd be hard to explain, but God damn it, that would be funny.
Wouldn't it be great to just see... Because what would the people on the street think of seeing him laying there in a pool of blood, just crumbled in a Wonder Woman costume?
They'd feel good about it and not know why.
Yeah, and people would be just snapping pictures. It'd be great. Good YouTube video. Might go viral.
Never know, right?
Put the pad back in. It's sticking up. I know. Don't you know how to put bra pads in?
You're killing my rod.
All right.
And this outfit came pre-stained, too.
What do you mean pre-stained?
A big stain right here on the crotch.
What is that? Ew! What happened there?
Paul's a creep.
That looks like...
Does it look like...
It doesn't have a drink stain kind of uniformity to it.
No.
It has kind of a... It starts out kind of big by the thigh and then tapers off right at where your naughties are.
That's evidence.
Yeah.
What is that?
I don't know. My old lady's sister wore it. She's a bartender.
Oh,
oh
God.
Oh, wow.
I finally got nailed in it.
It smells like iron.
Two or three.
Two or three have worn it without a washing?
Yeah. No one.
Oh, you're just going to get a yeast infection.
I'm getting a lot of visual radio rules. Woohoo! Well, if you're on Facebook or Pal Talk or check out some of our fine websites, you'll see what we're talking about. I tell you? It's 2009.
You don't need a visual. Here's what you do. Go Google Linda Carter.
Yeah.
And then take her out and put a slug in that outfit. There you go.
There was a belt with it. I don't know what happened to it.
Yeah, the belt doesn't fit.
No, it didn't. Oh, the belt doesn't fit?
No. Oh, how did that happen?
All right. Well, look, I sent it to all my followers on Twitter. And
Jessica Simpson's belt. She wore those pictures.
How about the one that Saturn uses?
See, there you go. Now it's visual for everybody.
There you go.
Opie Radio on Twitter. There you go. Oh, you get a picture of E-Rock as Wonder Woman. Let's. You want to do the Fluffernutter hat, or are we going too far now?
No, of course you should.
All right, E-Rock, you're going to do the Fluffernutter hat, too.
Yeah. All right.
All right.
People are asking if you stuffed your crotch.
No.
But did you push your boxers up into the crotch area?
Sure, Jimmy.
Just now to put it up here.
Jimmy, you have fat pubis.
Oh.
Okay.
Are you well hung?
Well, show Jimmy. Go over there. Jimmy, you think he's well hung?
I don't
he's not going to touch you.
Really?
Jesus, what is he got? I think he's got one big ball.
Let me poke. Wait, let me poke with my grapefruit.
Yeah.
I'm not going to touch you.
Yeah, he's going to poke it with your grapefruit. What has he got going on?
Jimmy poked the bulge with his grapefruit.
Yeah, but it looks like that grapefruit could be in the front of his pants.
I know.
I think it's just ball. What do you got going on, Iraq?
It is. I think it's just a satchel.
Throw out a number. Throw out a number.
Yeah. What? What do you got going on down there?
Just throw out a number.
I think maybe just six.
Maybe just six.
Yeah.
All right. Cool.
He's hung like an old-time bomb. Like Spy versus Spy, whatever the hell it was.
Spy versus Spy bomb, where it's all just round sack and a little stem coming out.
You rock rules, though. I've so turned the corner on you. You rule. You've never said no to us. It's got
Eric is the greatest.
Can we do the Fluffernutter hat, E-Rock, and then we're going to put you on the street to just horrify everybody again?
Yeah.
What's wrong? You're getting cut up by the wire?
The underwire is really bugging you.
It's not the underwire now. Whatever's in the padding, I think, is making me break out.
Oh, wait a minute.
It's starting to itch.
Your breasts are itchy?
I hope it's anthrax.
Crabs. It's crabs from the suit.
Yeah. And there's the old-time bomb. Maybe we could put that up on onaradio.com. All right. Why don't you sit down? We're going to continue doing our show as E-Rock gets the Fluffernutter hat. Hey, I see intern David is here today.
Yeah. Right.
You're in charge of everybody.
David, why don't you come over?
Come on over here because we're going to start. Where's Kenny? Kenny usually makes the hats for E-Rock. So I hear you're office manager and also you're the executive intern.
Executive intern and office manager over at the XM side.
And what do those jobs entail?
Executive intern entails me giving out orders to the other interns and telling them what to do.
Orders?
They must love that, huh?
Like when someone has to get the breakfast or get the coffees, I decide who gets to go do the breakfast, who gets to get the coffees, get the newspapers in the morning.
Delegate that responsibility.
Yes, I certainly do. I certainly do delegate that.
Are you taking the job very seriously?
Yes, I am.
Yeah? Yes, Sam, is he taking the job very seriously?
Extremely seriously. He's ready to be a leader.
Is he?
And can I ask David, why when you're talking to the mic, are you bent like you're being filmed in a hurricane? Why don't you just raise the mic up a little bit?
Raise the mic up and stand up straight.
Yeah, you wouldn't.
I don't know. That's how comfortable. That's how the mic is. I'm just
hunched over.
Yes, sir.
I want you to be comfortable.
I hear also that he does the mic checks every morning. Do we have that audio there? Well, what do you do for mic checks there, David?
Well, Tim comes in and he has to check all the microphones, so he tells me to check each one. So I go around all the mics and make sure that they're working. And Tim checks, and I just say like, "Oh, this is the mic," and talk into it. Like when he says, "Oh, okay, go test Anthony's mic," I say, "Oh, this is Anthony's mic. Hello, hello, Anthony's mic," and he checks to see if it works. And I do that with Jimmy's mic, the guest mic, and the mics on the couch.
Yeah?
And Opie just shrugged because I know he's wondering the same thing I am, which is why there's no tape.
Oh, here it is. Thank you.
When David's using the mic for production or doing this, you can tell he went to school for this because he puts a fist to his mouth and then to the mic to make sure there's the exact proper distance to the sound quality. Just like that.
Is that how far you're supposed to be?
That's what I was taught at the good old Connecticut School of Broadcasting. They told me to put her fist there so that you can have a...
No, when they
so
said put a fist there, distance. That's not what they meant. Apparently the kid enjoys German pornography as much as I do. He's a good boy.
He's cracking up now. He's cracking up.
Cracking up.
Yeah, but that's what they taught me, to put it so they have a proper distance between your mouth and the mic.
Let me try that. Hold on.
All right, let me try
it. I'm going to put a fist between
Wow, we've been doing this wrong for years.
Mic, and now talk. Wow.
Wow, it's perfect.
I don't like it. You know what?
The needles aren't pinning.
You got to go like
this. I think the kid just taught me something.
You got to get right on the mic.
I'm farther away.
Yeah, I like doing this.
And also,
gives me a little bass in my voice.
With talk radio, there is a dynamic depending on what you're doing. If you're yelling or if you're talking a little softer.
Yeah, you got
to
move.
You do have to kind of move around.
I'm just putting my fist up. I'm going with the professionals over at the school that I did.
Hey, what am I?
All right, you know what? Let me tell you something about the Connecticut School of Broadcasting, you cocksucker. Let me tell you something.
I think I'm considered a professional in the business.
Let me tell you the difference. We're doing it.
So I guess
those guys couldn't make it in the business, so they're teaching zeros like you how to get in the business.
A fist.
What, Kenny? Everyone heard you trying to whisper him a lot.
You whispered into a mic, Kenny.
Way to go, Kenny.
No.
Yeah. If they were so good, wouldn't they be doing radio?
I guess they taught me wrong.
Thank you.
I love how he said, well, they're professionals. We're telling them different.
They're not professionals.
And we're not professionals?
We are, but...
Look, the Connecticut School of Broadcasting...
I'm conflicting well,
they,
stuff.
We get paid to do the job, not teach the job.
I know.
And they get paid to teach it,
which
makes them professional teachers.
Right.
But they're not, like, professional broadcasters.
It might be a great company. I have no idea when it comes right down to it, but... I would say that most of those guys want to be doing a radio show, not teaching.
They wish they could be.
Yeah. Likes right. You anyway.
Right. Tell them about the famous alumni out of.
Oh,
yeah, David, that's what Kenny was whispering to that everyone in Tucson.
Famous
heard.
Alumni.
Yeah, did they tell you about the famous alumni that came out of there?
Oh, well, they told me.
And who are they?
Well, Jimmy's good friend, Artie Lang, is a Connecticut School of Broadcasting.
Is Artie a Connecticut School of Broadcasting?
Yeah, it's the same. Yes, yes, New Jersey, yeah.
It's pretty funny.
Because of that, Jimmy's canceling his gig with
him. I'm going to set fire to Artie's dressing room door when I see him.
All because of that? That's so rude.
That was that was kind of the joke. No, I wouldn't burn the man to death because he attended that school. No, I was kidding, David.
Yes.
It was a little joke.
Yes.
All right, so Artie, who else?
A sportscaster you might have heard of named Joe Beningo.
Beningo is my favorite guy at the Fan. I love Joe Beningo.
Yeah.
240 on the Fan, and he wants to cut his own throat when the Jets lose. He's an animal.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, that's famous.
Yes, sir.
List really falls off after Beningo, doesn't it?
Beningo and Arlen. There's also, I don't know if you guys know who Kevin Burkhardt is.
No one does.
He's the guy that, he's on SNY now, the Mets station. He reports on the field.
Okay,
on the field in SNY.
I don't know him.
No, we have no idea.
No one's ever heard of him. Mr. and Mrs. Burkhardt know him.
He's a sideline reporter. Like, he goes on the field during the Mets games and reports from the stands and stuff, and he does interviews with all the players.
Exactly. Yeah. All right, who else? Pam Oliver? Who else?
Pam Oliver, I don't think so.
No, I know.
Not the NFL on Fox woman, no.
Right, no. So who else besides? Artie is by far the biggest.
Artie and
Beningo is doing well.
And yeah, there's also Roger. Do you know Roger All?
Roger All?
Yeah, the director of sports on Fox 5.
Yes, he used to do a show
sports.
With Ted Parshall.
That's his name. He's a teacher at Connecticut School of Broadcasting, and everyone says he's like a real famous person. I never heard of him.
Has to say he's famous and you don't know it, he's not famous.
He's not famous.
According to the instructors there, he's like a legend.
No, he's not. He has a great cleaning product.
Boy, you really are sticking with that fist length away from the mic thing.
Yes, I certainly am.
He knows. Well, you want to hear him doing mic checks?
Oh, yes.
You recorded that?
Yeah, this is what he does every morning for everybody.
You recorded it? Oh.
What do you think?
Hello, it's Anthony Cumia. Hello, hello.
Wait. Okay, so you're checking my mic.
Correct.
And you have to say hello. This is Anthony Cumia.
I don't have to say that. I could say whatever I want to on the mic. I choose to pretend that I'm the person who uses that mic when I'm checking the mic.
I know, it was uncanny.
It's very smart. Because
yes,
then the person knows whose mic you're checking.
Mic you're checking.
Correct.
I like it.
All right.
Hello, it's Anthony Cumia. Hello, hello. Hello, hello, I'm a co-host.
Anthony Jumia. Hello, I'm a co-host. I'm a co-host.
Who's the co-host? Mike.
The one I'm standing on right now, sitting right now, is a co-host.
Okay.
Hello, hello, I'm a co-host. I'm a co-host.
Co-host, that's
Bob Kelly? Bob Kelly's a co-host sometimes. Patrice O'Neill, he's a co-host.
It's a guest mic, dummy.
The color of this microphone's cable's yellow, 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 yellow.
Now green.
This cable is green, green, hello, green, green, green. Hello, I'm Jimmy Norton. Hello, hello.
He did a little voice.
Hello.
Oh, it's very accurate. I like it. It sounds good.
All right, guys, Opie today. Opie Hughes.
Never calls himself that, by the way.
No, that's all right. Whatever.
I forgot the quote.
I hear you doing staff impressions.
Oh.
You sort of heard. I sort of heard a little Jimmy there, so.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I tried to do a Jimmy Norton voice there. Yeah.
I mean, I'm not that easy to do, but I mean, it's like, hello, I'm Jimmy Norton.
Hello, hello, hello. Jimmy Norton. Hello. Hello.
Who else do you do?
Kenny.
Oh, you do Kenny?
Yes, I did an impression of Kenny.
All right, let's hear it.
You guys got to look at me, like, because it's more an impression, it's basically like looking.
Sure, of course.
All right.
Do Kenny.
I'll do an impression of Kenny. That's my impression of Kenny, because he's always sleeping in his chair.
We got it.
He's always sleeping in his chair. That's good.
Oh, that's good.
It's not like the bosses are listening or anything.
That's the
way
best.
To blow up his spot.
That's the best thing to do, take an impression of somebody from when they're, like, sleeping, not really doing anything.
Yeah.
That's the same impression, by the way, of everyone else who's sleeping in the world.
Yeah.
Here's my impression of every human who sleeps. Sorry, David.
It's all right. I know it's everyone sleeping, but...
What do you do Steve, too?
Yeah, Steve, I just, like, run really fast out the door. Because he's always, like, rushing out the door to do something. to like go in here and tell someone an important message.
We put a door that goes out to the side of the building.
Hold on, that should be that impression of Kenny should be your impression of Steve working.
Wow, you are killing David today.
It's really funny.
Oh,
why is that funny though?
It is. I don't
mean,
know.
Jimmy's a very funny man, but why is that joke in particular funny?
Because it is. It just is.
Are you saying because it's accurate?
I guess so. I don't want to say anything on the air, but I guess I just did.
No, you're allowed to.
You can say whatever you want. Do you think Steve's a good worker?
He's a good worker, yeah.
What did you say right before we went on the air?
I don't want to say anything about him on the air.
No, on the air, no, you're on the allowed air, you're to safe. Say anything. You're safe.
They should have taught you.
Other people.
They should have taught you that at the Connecticut School of Broadcasting.
Yeah, you know, the professionals.
Yeah.
On the air, you're safe, because what you say, it can be interpreted as entertainment value, no matter how realistic it is.
Uh-huh.
But you're safe, so you could say it. What did you say before?
About what?
About Steve.
I just was telling my impression of how
I'm.
He's
good?
He's all right.
Do you think he's good?
No. He's all right, though.
No.
Wow. He wouldn't do too well in the interrogation room, David. Wow, you know, at least you know he's not an Al Qaeda mastermind.
He's all right.
Do you really think he's all right?
Yeah, he's just all right.
Do
yeah.
You think he's all right?
Yeah.
David.
Yes. You're on the air. You're safe here. This is a safe place.
Yeah.
Very safe place. Now answer Sam's question.
Do you think Steve's good?
Sometimes. He could be good sometimes.
Like when?
I don't know.
Percentage of good to bad.
Yeah.
What would you say? How much percent good?
Remember, you're in a safe place. You're in front of us. We make all final decisions, my friend.
You say sometimes he's good. Is it sometimes, yeah. You know, what percent of the time?
There he is.
What percent of the time? Don't let him intimidate you.
He's right there in the
phone. Don't intimidate
booth.
The witness.
I can't do it.
Opie and Anthony are on your side.
That's
what
right.
Percent? It's the Opie and Anthony show, not the Steve show.
I can't
show.
Do
We're
it.
Asking
I can't
you.
Do it. It's not right.
We are asking you, what,
I can't
what
do
percentage?
It.
What percentage of the time is he good?
What percentage, for real?
I can't do it. He's right there.
Say a number. Come on. What percentage?
Now he's behind me.
What percentage?
Now he's like putting his face to my now he's blowing oh my in God. My...
Dave, is it closer to 0 or 10?
No, that's more than 10.
David?
More than 10?
Yeah.
David, what's it less than?
David's, Steve's right on top of David.
I know.
Is it less than 20?
Yeah, he's whispering my... I'd say he's gonna like, beat me up or something.
Oh. Or he's not.
I don't know. I'd say probably... It's not as bad as people are making it out to be. It's probably like 50.
Well, no, what
50?
Yeah.
What did Sam ask you? Sam said, is Steve good?
Yeah.
What was your answer?
Is he good?
He's all right.
How good is he?
He's all right.
No, what did you say?
David.
He's all right.
David.
What did you say?
What'd you say?
He's all right.
That's not what he said.
I didn't mean what I said, though.
What did you say, though?
I said no, but I didn't mean that.
Why didn't you mean it?
No, I'm just joking around. I didn't mean that.
All right.
Leica presents us.
Whatever you just said.
What percentage?
50.
No.
No.
Yes, yes.
David.
See,
yes.
Steve's intimidating the hell out of him. He's in here. And even with that, David can only admit that it's 50.
Yeah, I know, right?
Just want to acknowledge that.
Even with intimidation, that's
right.
Failing great.
Right. Steve wasn't around, I think that number would be lower in David's eyes. All right, we got to start the Fluffernutter hat on E-Rock as we go to break here.
David, congratulations, by the way, on your new duties. You're doing them very well.
Oh, I thank you. If I may say one thing, Steve wanted me to say what I said about Travis. He wants to know, wants you guys to know what I was saying about Travis.
What did you say about Travis?
Oh.
I was, because we're on the topic of, like, how do I rate the staff members here. So Travis, I would say, didn't do any work.
But Travis isn't even here to defend himself today.
He's slacking off.
Yeah.
Well, taking the vacation day.
I guess apparently, David, you're not privy to the emails on a nightly basis that we all get to share in?
No, I'm not privy to those.
Where Travis pretty much gives a rundown of
what's happening
all
the world.
Big stories of the world.
He doesn't email the interns, no.
Ooh.
So what you're saying is you're speaking out of complete ignorance.
I'm just speaking out of what I see. Not what I see. I don't see these emails, so I don't know about him.
So you don't see what he's doing on his off time.
No, I do not.
As he goes on his computer and other things and finds things. Danny's got some.
I don't see it that, no.
Aside from not being on the emails, you're also not in the office before the show, nor in Travis's phone booth during the show.
No, I'm not.
Nor in Travis's area at the XM Sirius side of the show. Would you even really know what anybody does around here?
Let me tell you something.
You don't work too closely to any of us.
That's true. Tell you something, David. No matter what time I get in here,
yes.
Sometimes I'm in here early.
Uh-huh.
Travis is always at his desk when I walk in. Doesn't matter what time it is. And he is working diligently.
Nick Carter is usually at his desk when you walk in.
Nick Carter.
He loves that, Jimmy.
Nick Carter.
He loves that one.
So
that's good. I like that guy. He's a good guy.
To base what do you base your opinion on?
I'm just basing my opinion on one day, probably just one day in the very beginning of my internship when I saw Travis just staring into space in the phone.
I'll tell you what he's basing it on. The amount, I guess, to David, the amount of work that you do depends on how much you're liked by that person. So if Travis really doesn't like you, then I guess he really doesn't do any work. You know, I'm kind of half and half with you, so I guess I must work just half good.
What do you think about Danny? Do you think he works a lot?
Certainly do. Danny's always working hard.
Really?
Travis doesn't like him?
At this point in time, I don't think much of anybody really enjoys David too much.
I love the kid. Sam's got his hand raised too.
Well, because you guys just have your little on air time, and then it's back home. So, but we actually have to deal with him.
But he's the executive intern, right. Danny.
He is the executive intern.
I know. You don't just get that position. He earned it.
I got to know my role. I'm sorry.
Are you putting that on your resume when you go to look for a job that you are the executive intern?
I'm gonna switch my resume to executive. Yes.
Executive intern.
I had just intern. Now I'm going to switch to executive intern / office manager.
Okay, executive intern. And then you have to put duties that you did as an executive intern. What do you list?
I'm going to list and telling the other interns what to do.
Good.
Giving the orders to other interns.
Other interns.
This old man that is interning.
Yes, correct. The 38-year-old, yes.
The 38-year-old.
With two kids.
With two kids.
Oh, Jesus. Do you listen to the executive intern?
Yes, I have to listen to.
Yeah, Sam is forcing all interns to listen to the executive intern.
Sam is instigating.
You know he's involved with this.
Sam is the one that appointed me executive intern.
Of course he
appointed you.
He appointed me. Yes.
Oh, appointed. Okay.
Yeah.
So he appointed you. I didn't know you had that in your job description, Sam.
He's just a dick. I love it.
Of course he is.
What I really like, David and me, Sirius came and told all the interns that they all had to have a mentor and that it should probably just be Steve. So everybody just put Steve as their mentor, so he just signs the paperwork, except David, because David said Steve wouldn't do a good job as his mentor.
And set a false on this kid.
And then asked if I would be his mentor instead.
Wow, he actually asked you.
Oh, wow, that's nice.
Yes, they said
he went from a bear to a viper.
Yes, we had a meeting with HR people from Sirius.
Yeah,
and you told them you didn't think.
They said Steve will be everyone's mentor, and I said I don't want Steve to be my mentor.
You told HR that.
Yes, I did.
You pretty much ratted out Steve.
Yes, I did.
No, I didn't rat him out. No, I didn't rat him. I just said I don't want Steve to be my mentor.
Do you understand that that's negative? That negatively impacts Steve to the superiors.
I asked them, could I have Sam as my mentor? And they said, who's Sam? And I explained to them, and I showed them.
Oh, okay.
Okay, Sam, you can be good. Okay.
Not good.
Wow. Sam is my mentor, yes.
Paul has something.
Look at this. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Paul, you have something?
I just wanted to point out that some of David's executive duties does include removing staples from pieces of paper and then restapling them after they've been filed and scanned.
Gotta be done.
And that you have to tell him that every day. How to take the tape staples out and restaple again.
Why are you restapling stuff there, executive intern?
Those are the rules for all the darn paperwork that we got to clean up.
Darn paperwork.
Radio friendly.
We got to clean up the mess of one specific individual who messed up all the paperwork and threw it all over their office. And we got to fix it all up, and it's all unorganized.
Who did that?
A certain individual that's no longer with us.
Okay.
Yes, a certain individual that's no longer with us threw all the paperwork all over the office and messed it up, and we have to reorganize it and scan it and.
Why did he throw it all over?
He didn't do a good job. He wasn't doing his job. So now we got to fix it all up. So that's why I'm unstapling so that they can scan it.
Unstapling, scanning, And then stapling again.
Stapling again, then filing them, sorting them by year and by alphabetical order.
He doesn't scan. He just pulls the staples out and then puts new staples in.
Oh, okay. You're not in charge of the scanning part.
No,
what,
I'm
do you
not
delegate
in charge of
that?
Scanning.
Why aren't you doing that part?
You delegate responsibility to someone else?
Yes.
more like he's not willing to learn how to do the scanning.
Do you know how to scan?
Yes, I know how to scan.
So why don't you scan?
I don't know. I just kind of decided on my own. Okay, I'm gonna do. I'm gonna staple. I'm gonna unstaple. I'm gonna do the alphabetizing.
Now, actually, about the time you get in, I've heard about this too. Now, what time do the interns report?
We are required to meet Sam at XM at 4:30 a.m.
Sam, 4:30 a.m. David, what time do you come in?
I come in at 4:40.
No, you don't come in at 4:40.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Your mentor is saying you don't come in at 4:40.
That's not true. I come in at 4:40.
You come in at 5 o'clock.
Mentor?
I'm not coming at 5.
Everyone is saying you come in at 5.
Generally, he arrives around 4:45, which he says. I don't think it's necessarily true most of the time. But today, he got here at 4:45 because we were walking from XM to CBS. Even though he saw us, he went to XM anyway, and when questioned, he explained he had to go up to XM, even though we were already there, to make sure the other interns didn't forget anything.
Oh, Jesus.
Takes his duties seriously.
So exactly. Why do you come in later than the other interns?
I got no explanation for that one.
But you're the executive intern.
That's one of the
you're
perks.
You're trying to make up your own hours?
No, I'm not trying to. No.
I think, David, that's one of the perks of being the executive intern.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what he just did.
I don't know, he's whispering to you while I'm talking to you. He's the executive intern. I think that's one of the perks of being.
So that's a perk. You're able to just come in later.
I guess it is.
Are you going to be supervising the Fluffernutter hat that we're putting on E-Rock to make sure it's done right?
Only if interns are doing it.
So if interns are involved, you supervise.
Yes, I don't supervise any of the staff members, only interns.
Only interns. Paul, yes. One of our interns.
I would just like to point out that David's supervision usually involves asking one of us what he should be doing.
But you're the executive intern.
You're the executive intern.
Why are you asking them?
Yeah,
but
then he doesn't do it anyway. So he'll ask us what to do, we'll tell him, and he won't do it.
That is not true. I do what
I'm told.
Because
he's the executive. He doesn't have to listen to you.
Right.
I forgot.
The reason why I asked
him
because... It's because the paperwork project that we're involved in was explained.
It's a project.
Yes, it's a project. It was explained to Paul several times and not to me. So Paul is the one that knows what to do.
Right.
Okay. With that project, I was never explained what to do for
you're
that.
You're just
project.
Getting information. You're not asking for directions.
If you
correct.
Weren't, if you weren't on the air right now, what would you be doing as executive intern?
Mm-hmm.
I probably
this second.
This second.
Yeah. If you weren't on the air.
Eating chalk.
I would never do a thing like that.
Well, of course not.
Well, no,
what would you be doing?
Joke.
I would probably be thinking of duties to give to other interns.
Like what?
Yeah, like what?
I just want to know what you'd be doing as executive intern right now if you weren't in front of that mic.
That's a really good question. Good question.
Oh, my God.
Why are you laughing?
Because it's funny.
David, do you see yourself more as an on-air guy? Is that where your heart is? You're an on-air guy.
As opposed to a behind-the-scenes cutting up audio? Yes, definitely.
Cutting up audio? You don't need to learn to do that.
He has no desire to cut up audio.
I kind of learned how to do that at Connecticut Schools of Broadcasting. But, but when I finished, I'm like, that's not for me.
Yeah.
Is your last name Brent?
My last name is not Brent, no.
You got kind of that vibe going.
My last name being Brent?
Yeah, David Brent. From The Office?
Oh, I didn't get it.
I'm not as professional.
Wait, he got it. He got it. Yeah.
He got it. Look, he's cracking up.
Yeah.
He's laughing.
He's laughing.
Let's have a laugh we have around here. There's been a rape up there.
We do have to take a break. We're like 20 minutes late
at the stuffed monkey.
Yeah, because of the executive intern, David. All right, David.
I didn't say anything. It's a scream.
Like it's madness all the time.
We have to take a break. Continue with that. So E-Rock's going to get his Fluffernutter hat. There are going to be interns involved with this, David, so you supervise them. Kenny will also be applying the Fluffernutter to make a hat.
Mm-hmm.
As E-Rock continues being dressed as Wonder Woman.
Fluffernutter is deceiving. That's fluff and peanut butter. Will this only be
marshmallow? It's just fluff.
Okay, so it's just fluff.
It's a fluff hat.
Ah. I hated Fluffernutters as a kid because I never liked peanut butter, but I used to love just fluff on bread.
Really?
Yeah. Little Anthony trivia for you there.
How do you not like peanut butter?
I hate peanut butter.
Peanut butter rules.
I despise peanut butter.
Even a light. I was eating peanut butter last night on celery. It's a hit.
It's amazing. No, hate it.
It's
hate it. Looks like really duty. Good. Don't like it.
It looks like duty. So what? So does Hershey bars. So does Snickers.
Only have to eat chicken wings.
They're
oof. Your almonds. Boy, almonds.
Oh, almonds.
Cause quite
a
problem.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, quick break, and yeah, we'll continue with the nonsense. Opie and Anthony. Jim Norton's got tickets going on sale today at 9.
For the 21st of February show with Artie Lang at the Tower Theater.
Opie and Anthony. It's Friday. I'm looking at E-Rock. He's dressed as Wonder Woman.
Yeah.
I finally was able to send the picture to everybody following me on Twitter.
It's gorgeous.
Opie Radio. I had a problem for a while, but it's finally there. And now we're making a fluff hat. Anthony corrected me. It's not a fluffer nutter hat. It's a fluff hat.
Fluffer nutter was the combination of fluff and peanut butter on bread. You'd make a fluffer nutter sandwich.
Right.
But just marshmallow fluff on bread was what I used to eat. And it was very hard to spread on bread.
Which, by the way, yeah. Would just be a nightmare to try to make a sandwich out of that stuff.
Get but, very pasty.
But it was worth it in the end because of the goodness that was involved.
Marshmallowy goodness.
Yes. Now, we also have intern David, who we learned today is an executive intern. He's in charge of all the other interns.
Executive intern.
And, of course, this came about because Sam's a dick.
Right.
And
Sam is a manipulating little crap.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're upsetting David.
David, really fast, because we're going to do a little news and stuff as we continue. the freaking fluff hat is just melting down the sides of
E-Rock. Oh, it is starting to melt, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's
but
pulling my hair.
It's
you
pulling
look like
the hair.
My three favorite porno movies.
don't move your head forward, because now it's starting to drip in. It's going to drip in your eyes in a few minutes here. Kenny's doing a very good job as he applies the fluff to E-Rock's head.
Move the mic closer to Eric and we talk stuff.
The Wonder Woman tiara is actually helping because it's like a cake mold.
Yeah.
It's almost holding
absolutely.
It in there.
Yeah.
David,
yes.
The interns are kind of helping out here. Are they doing a good job? What is your problem? You obviously have a problem.
Well,
what's the problem?
You're eight fists away, David.
Yeah. What's your problem?
Eight fists? I'm just...
what's the you're supervising the interns.
I'm sort of supervising, but they're just pretty much doing their own thing.
Well, but you're supposed
you're a supervisor, for God's sake.
What do you want them to be doing?
I wanted Joe over there to actually start applying some of the fluff to E-Rock's head.
Yeah.
Take the bull by
Joe
the chauffeur.
Did. Joe just did.
And now he did, yeah.
Right. True joke.
If you want to fire one of the interns, we'll allow that today.
You know, the horn.
Oh, sorry. I'm not listening.
It's okay. Neither is anyone else.
I apologize.
Yeah. I just got a blech.
I don't really want to.
Thank you. Point blank. Just blech.
And that was kind.
Yeah. Sam?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you had some. No?
No.
Okay. All right. As they continue applying the fluff to E-Rock.
E-Rock, what's with the face?
To make a fluff hat.
Because when Kenny moves the fluff around, it pulls my hair. So as he's trying to even it out, it's pulling my head back and pulling my hair
it's
out.
It's very sticky.
Yeah, but
sticky.
You have so much hair to lose. Don't even worry about it.
Exactly. Oh, yeah, I'm in the minority here.
That's this.
Oh. Can't even fight back.
Hurt a little bit.
It hurts a little bit.
Hurts
I'm not
a
even
little
gonna,
bit.
Not even going to lie to you.
That's all right.
It gets a shot in every once in a while.
I'd rather have a little male pattern balding than be a complete idiot.
Luckily for you, you got both.
I'm just looking forward. I'm looking forward to the day Anthony takes the hat off because, you know.
I take the hat off, by the way.
I'm paying attention.
Now, I used to wear the hat all the time, but I take the hat off the second I get my vehicle.
Is it growing?
And then it doesn't go back on until, you know.
Okay. Is it looking good back there?
I'm seeing some stubblies.
The hair plugs are
coming
up.
They're not plugs. It's individual follicles that have been implanted
harvested.
Artistically
from the harvest
hair,
area
in the direction that my hair grows, and it's my natural hair harvested from the back.
Harvested.
I know Jimmy hates that. That's why I say it. And it is starting to speckle. I see little speckles and little whiskeries coming up. So it's like when you shave your head.
But the word... It was from the harvest area, and there are speckles.
There's a harvested area where they harvest the hair.
That nest. I hate the word harvest and nest. Anything nest. With an S.
We're nesting.
They're having a tough time keeping the fluff on top of his head.
Yeah.
It's just starting to drip.
It's dripping.
Yes, Kenny.
Oh, wow. Hold on. Fluff on top of his head.
He's melting. I think that's the best we're going to do.
Oh, boy, Kenny. You know.
Oh, boy. Just trot right over Jimmy.
Why don't you just trample everything that's sacred about this show? You all right, Jimmy? Jimmy wants to kill somebody.
Nah, it's fine.
All right.
I was just saying
that hurt. He's really hurting now.
We're going to give it another shot. He's got fluff on his brain, so it would be a fluff of nothing.
All right.
Yeah, not a great one.
Would have been better right off the cuff like that.
Of course it would have, but why not? Shouldn't you have?
Yes, David?
I have to agree with all you guys. That's just a bunch of fluff on his head. It's not much of a hat.
Oh, so you're not happy about the job that is being done by Kenny and your fellow interns. What do you suggest, David?
Dictate.
Well, it's pretty much just Kenny doing all the work for the hat at the moment.
Well, it's not very, you know, too many hands spoil the hat. It's not like very moldable either. You're just pretty much what they're doing now is almost
there he goes. Joe's doing
folding
some work.
It. They're taking it and folding it up. Whatever's dripping, they're pulling back up on top. Yeah, it's more like a fluff beret than a fluff hat.
I agree.
And every time they pull up the melting fluff, it pulls his hair and he's wincing in pain.
Well, we could change the bit into like a fluff Elvis, like...
Elvis hairdo, too.
Hairdo or a pompadour. We could do something a little different. I love the fact that David jumped in and goes, oh, there he goes. He's doing something. He's working now, finally. That right, David?
Really, right, Opie.
All right.
Really horrendous.
As they continue doing that...
More is coming up. Oh, it's falling down?
Yeah.
Just let it drift. It'll really annoy him.
Ah!
Yeah.
His hair's coming out.
Oh, wow. That is really pulling. Wow, that stuff could be used for something else other than eating. You could use that as some kind of a weapon. That's one of those non-lethal weapons the police should use on people.
Yeah.
Just spray it out of a hose.
Yes.
When they pull the fluffer nutter or whatever it is, the fluff up, the hair is stuck to the fluff.
And it's pulling out.
Yeah.
It's ripping out of his head.
You're losing hair?
Yeah, a bit.
All right.
I don't know how you're going to get it out of your head. I don't care. I don't think warm water is going to do it. I think there'll be enough resistance.
Yeah.
Like the water. I don't think it's soluble. I don't think it's water soluble.
And know what they're doing? They're like combing the fluff like it's hair. Yeah. They keep trying to comb it back.
Pulling it
and
back.
Up.
And it rips hair out while that's happening.
It's on Pal Talk 2,
Ant. You take the extra and give it to Mike.
Huh?
Take the extra hair and give it to Mike.
Oh, see that?
Oh, damn. You know,
because you don't have
it's
hair.
It's always the person sitting in the fluff seat that has to make the insults.
Let's go under his eye.
Oh, it's dripping down.
All right, Kenny, it's dripping
down into his eye. I want it to look like a fluff elephant man. I just want that all over his face.
No, if it drips into his eye, he's going to look like a fluffer.
I probably wouldn't let it drip in his eye just because of eyelashes and stuff. That could be a major problem.
Safe. That's all right. You don't need eyelashes.
Look at me being responsible. What's wrong with me? All right. Hey, Joe Torre's got a book out, and we're trying hard to get him on the show next week. He's doing a lot of press.
Yes, he is.
And, man, it's coming out. Now the players are fighting back. First, Joe Torre took his shots in the book that's coming out. And now the players are basically saying he wasn't a good guy?
Well, Joe Torre never really said much, to tell you the truth, derogatory about the Yankees, especially.
Right.
I mean, you know, he was the skipper of that team. How many years, Jimmy?
He was the skipper. I'm going to guess from 96 was his first, because Showalter's last was 95. So I think it was 96 to 2006, 10 years?
Yeah. He did 10?
Wow,
that's a nice stint with a team like the Yankees.
No kidding.
I mean, you know, so he never really said anything. They did relatively well during those years. I mean, the tail end of it.
They did great, right?
But you know, I mean, it's just because it's the Yankees that you go, oh, well, you know, they kind of fell apart at the end. But any other team that had that record would be phenomenal.
Yeah.
But he never said anything bad about the players. You knew when he was unhappy with a player, but he usually spin it like, well, we're working with him and trying to get some such and such out of a slump or something. And then he goes to L.A. after he's, I don't know, relieved of his Yankee duties.
Mm-hmm.
A little premature, I think. I think they could have given him another year. And I think that pissed him off. He goes over with the Dodgers, has a good season,
mm-hmm.
and then writes a book. And starts saying some of the stuff that was on his mind during those Yankee years.
And isn't there some kind of code in sports where you don't talk about the crap that happens in the locker room? Wasn't there a famous quote?
Yep.
Stump Rain was saying the quote?
Hello.
When you when you go in the Green Bay Packers locker room, there's a sign as you leave says, "What you see here, what you say here. When you leave here, let it stay here."
Ah. Yeah.
And it's one of those unwritten rules, I guess, in sports in general. Well, now David Wells, because what did he say about Wells?
Called him a fat slob. No, I'm kidding.
What did he say about Wells? I forgot. But Wells was on the radio.
I think he said he was intentionally
Why don't you just take a microphone?
Well, I had the information. I figured I'd
See? Why didn't you ask David first if you should step
David,
up to the mic?
David, can I talk on the microphone?
Yes, go ahead, Scott. You can talk.
But David, are you a little annoyed that he didn't ask you and he just kind of jumped and kind of, you know, messed up the flow of the show a little bit?
Almost pushing you out of the way.
I'm very annoyed.
What are you going to do about it as executive intern?
I'm going to make sure that it never happens again.
And how are you going to do that?
I'm just going to be very careful. I'm going to watch his every move.
Watch his every
move. You do have the info, though?
But if he has the info, I'll let him speak.
Oh, what a tool.
He did say that David Wells was intentionally like a ball breaker during his time there. You know, the other guys were maybe that's how they were. You know, that's how they were. Kevin Brown was just a ball breaker. That's how he was born.
Yeah.
But David Wells went out of his way to bust chops, and he didn't like that.
You know what, though? I don't think that was much of a secret. I think everybody knew David Wells is a loose cannon, kind of a ball breaker. He'll speak what's on his mind, and he's been in trouble for that before.
I think it was also that one playoff game where I think he started like game four of a series, and he has the second inning, he bowed out because of his bad back, and
dumped him out of
the playoffs, and Corey didn't like that.
Huh. Well, now David Wells is basically saying he would punch Torrey in the face if he saw him.
I don't know if it's involved
in this clip, but let's take a listen to what Wells is saying. I'm distracted because the fluff is just melting all over E-Rock's face right now.
Oh, God, I didn't turn around.
It's just horrendous.
It looks like it's a bathing cap in 1920.
Right.
It does. Yeah, you look like a
from
flapper.
From a speakeasy.
One of those platinum blonde flappers from the speakeasies.
I was thinking it looked like a shower cap.
Yeah.
It's like a Lord Fauntleroy hairdo.
Yeah.
Ah, David.
David's having the proverbial ball.
Wow. It's turning into a fluff mullet. Fluff a mullet.
Yeah. It looks like the thing.
Oh, no, it's dripping down his neck now. There it goes.
There it goes. Oh.
David, tell your interns what to do. Our fluff hat is getting...
Get up there and fix it. Quick.
All right. Maybe someone is suggesting we get E-Rock out on the street because it's cold out there and it all like...
Oh, that'll solidify
it a little
better.
Yeah, let's go to the other side.
All right, E-Rock, why don't you hit the street with your fluff mess?
My whole right ear is plugged.
What?
No, you gotta fix it a little bit, Joe.
It's a losing
look at that.
Battle.
See? David just stepped in.
It's a losing battle. Now it's over his eye.
It's over his eye. He's lost an eye.
Oh no!
All right.
This could be a problem.
He's lost an eye.
All right.
Oh, it's on his eyelid. You know how sticky.
Oh, no.
All right, this drives me crazy.
Yeah,
imagine
your
upper eyelid, whenever you blink, you feel sticky in there.
Yeah. Does that bother you?
Oh, God, would that bother me.
Yeah. You got to put some behind his knees, too.
Ah, so every time he walks, I hate that.
Put some behind his knees.
No.
You want to go outside with this mess, E-Rock?
Oh. All right, why not?
All right, E-Rock, go outside so it'll solidify a little bit. Here's what David Wells is saying about Joe Torrey.
If you weren't Joe's boy, he could care less about you. You know, he just had he ran his tight ship the way he wanted to. You know, don't get me wrong, he's not a bad manager. I just thought he was a bad individual because of the fact that he didn't treat everybody the same.
Mm. All right. One of them went on to say that he would punch him if he saw him.
Yeah.
So there you go. But I'm looking forward to this book now.
E-Rock looks like he's ready to preside over an English course.
Yes! That's a good one.
Oh, is it really sticky, E-Rock?
I just made it worse.
What'd you do?
Instead of moving it off my eye, it's now in my eye.
Oh, boy. All right. Should wear glasses first, and then you lick them clean.
All right, let's take a quick break, and we'll continue.
Get him out on the street.
Yeah.
It'll solidify
in
the cold weather.
All right, we'll check in with you guys on the street next. Opie and Anthony, stay there. E-Rock looks sad, just sitting there, fluff or nutter, or fluff is just melting in his eyes. He can't hear anymore. We can't even get him outside because it's just dripping everywhere. It's a complete disaster over there.
It's encasing his head, and where it's going down over his eyes, it's almost like he's got a furrowed brow.
Yeah.
Like he's angry. Yeah, it's dripping down his nose now.
Yeah. And that's no one's really helping bad. Him. How are you going to get that out of your hair, E-Rock? I can't hear you. Use the fist thing. You got to be a fist away, remember?
I have no idea. I'm probably going to have to shave my head.
Yeah, but you got to get it kind of out before you can even do that.
I know.
Very hot water will melt that away.
I don't know. Yeah?
Yeah, see?
I just had it on my hand, and it came right off when I put hot water on it. So yeah. It should be good.
Yeah, there you go.
Same thing.
You're going to have to deal with some hot, scalding water on your head. We could do that on the satellite side. We'll just dump boiling water on your head.
Because I've had bubble gum on my hand, and it's come right off, and so the hair is the same thing.
Yeah, there you go. All right, so he's not going outside.
By the way, next, bubble gum hat.
Bubble gum hat?
Yeah, we all chew up big, huge things of gum and just slap it in his hair.
Yes.
Yeah.
What if we invite all the listeners down that day? They all chew bubble gum, and they get to just put it on your hair. That's a good one. E-Rock, that's good.
I think someone else on this program needs to step up for once. And
ooh, like who?
I'm thinking, I don't know,
you mean
somebody
step
with
up
a
and
lot
have,
of hair.
Have your job?
Maybe not so much on his head, but on his face and back.
Ah, Steve, yeah.
Definitely talking about Steve.
Why would... What, Sam?
Sam is an idiot. He goes, he's talking about Steve. He's definitely talking about Steve. Just the sarcasm that oozes from him.
Steve, how do you feel about that?
Steve, comment? Comment, Steve? Comment?
I think that's a horrible idea. Thank you very much.
Good one. Thank you.
They didn't like your improv, Steve.
I know they don't.
You,
Yes.
All right. Super Bowl Sunday.
Is it? Oh, that's right. It is.
I think we did a really good job hyping this game for everybody.
Everybody did. Everyone's really conscious that it's going on.
Can't wait.
All the parties. I don't know which one I'm going to go to.
Yeah.
I've been invited to so many parties that people are having.
I was hoping you were going to have one, and you saw what happened during the commercials. I kind of invited myself to your Super Bowl party that you're not having.
If I was having one other person over to watch it, I'd say, sure, come on over.
Instead of me, my wife and you just awkwardly sitting there watching the Super Bowl.
No one.
Two teams that we don't care about.
It's not even like I care. Yeah, I don't care about the teams.
They didn't even sell all the commercials. There's two left.
It's not like, it's just this year, I could give a crap.
Why is that?
I think a lot of people have...
And some people say because the Giants aren't in it and all that. No, there's been other Super Bowls where you don't care about the teams, but you get caught up in the hype.
There's a priority shift right now that I think a lot of people are having.
Yeah.
Like, my mental priorities are elsewhere. They're not on Super Bowl and things like that. They're on pretty much keeping your job.
Right.
And doing, you know... as good a job as you can, mm-hmm. worrying about the economy, just things like that. There are too many things that I'm preoccupied with right now.
Yeah.
That was a good one, Danny. There's too many things that I'm preoccupied with to worry about things like the Super Bowl and things like that, you know? I don't care.
I could care less.
Even if the Giants were in it, I'm not like a huge Giants fan, so don't put me in that category where you'd watch. But I still wouldn't be like, whoopity-doo, let me get out and get a party going.
Yeah.
I don't care. We got a new president in there that I'm very
loving,
very unsure of, to say the least. Rocks don't hit in money. Uh-huh. You know, that's right. So there's a lot of things. On my mind, and the Super Bowl is kind of back a ways.
You know what people are into?
What?
Yes.
Fluff hats.
No, the fluff hat was a disaster. Look at this thing.
Oh, my God.
What does it look like? It's just dripping everywhere now.
Looks
there's
like
no
a
height.
70-year-old guy when he finally finishes, just kind of oozing out of the top of his head.
He looks like a bird watcher who fell asleep.
Yeah, E-Rock, you're a mess.
I'm bird watching.
All right.
All right, we get it. He repeats the punch.
Danny's getting really
times.
I see what's going on in the studio today.
Yeah.
Danny is really just wants to punch David in the face.
Well, it doesn't end, though. See, like, it's not like this is like a bit that, you know, once the show is over, like, the David character goes away and real David comes out. No, this is David.
So, this is him.
You know, you guys get to go home at 11 o'clock, and, you know, we all have to deal with him until the afternoon. So.
Yeah, and we walk in the elevator together. Oh, that David, wow, that was fun today. And he's, you know, he's still in the office just
doing the everybody. Same thing and still repeating the punchlines of jokes, you know, over and over again. It's the same guy. This is not a bit. This is the actual person of David.
This is him.
David, why are you depressed?
I'm not depressed at all. I'm not.
You're kind of, like, sitting in the chair. Your head's kind of sideways.
No, I'm just observing E-Rock at the moment.
Yeah?
I'm observing the fluff hat, yes.
Making sure he's doing a good job. Good,
why are you observing that?
It's funny.
So why don't you say E-Rock's fluff hat into the mic over and over again so you can let everybody else know that it's really funny to you. The other day he's taking inventory over at Satellite and
out of himself.
You know, we've all been on like an office kick for, you know,
Time.
So I was like, David, what are you doing? He tells me. So I go, now I'm gonna need 5 reams of Dunder Mifflin paper. Just as a dumb thing. It wasn't even supposed to be funny, but he goes, Dunder Mifflin. Dunder Mifflin. Like he had to say it
don't
like
look
4
at me.
Times.
You're looking at me like you want to punch me.
Hey, no.
It's good when he looks at someone, because for the most part, he doesn't look at anybody.
What's the matter, David? You're
nothing's
right?
the matter, no.
Right?
Which is a I'm all right,
which
sure.
This is a symptom.
I'm all right.
Who do you hate the most in the workplace right now? It might change week to week, but right now, who do you hate the most at the workplace?
Who do I hate the most?
Yeah.
Yes.
Be honest, David.
He's looking at
he's
Danny.
He's staring at Danny.
Is it Danny?
I have to go with Danny right at the
Danny?
Moment.
Why is that?
I don't know. He's just making fun of me, I guess. That's probably why.
You're very sensitive to the being made fun of, right? Yeah.
Well, in that sort of nature, yeah.
On this radio show, that really is a good trait to have.
Yeah. But the thing is that...
Do you think he's mean-spirited?
No.
Okay.
Well,
you know what it is? I'll tell you what it is.
You're wrong. He is.
Sam likes to, like, manipulate and, like, he likes to get into the whole angle of everything, and, like, that's where he gets his pleasure from. I just don't have that same kind of patience. So when David starts in with his garbage, I just, you know, I'm just very blunt and short with
garbage.
Him.
He's calling your what you do garbage.
Yes, he is.
I guess that's why you hate him the most.
Yeah.
Right now.
Yes. All right. Yeah. Hey, the economy sucks. We're going to move on. But the Snuggie.
Yeah.
We had a Snuggie in studio. Jimmy tried it on. It is horrendous.
It was a hit.
But they're buying them like crazy.
Come on, admit it. You've seen it, and you may have even thought about buying it. And you know what? You're not alone. While retail sales of everything else seem to be going down, Snuggies, the blankets with sleeves, are selling through the roof, with more than 4 million sold since September. Even finicky fashion-forward New Yorkers in the trendy meatpacking district are snuggling up to the idea of
the Snuggie. Yeah, because the back is
open.
You
know the snuggly thing? When I buy it? Yeah, with the sleeves? Yes.
People who are in the economy and you feel like it's a cozy thing, you think, oh, it's cozy, it's nice, it's a blanket.
It's horrendous.
It is horrendous.
It's not comfortable.
Because the back is open.
Yeah, right on. So you're prepared for some meatpacking.
Right. It's sort of a pop culture item now, is what they're saying. But let's give it a little time. It's not quite the Chia Pet.
They're building a cult with these Snuggies.
It's because
they
everyone
look like a cult
goofed
member.
On it. It's not like, wow, this is great, let me get one. It's because everyone goofed on the commercial, because everyone looked in the commercial looked like an idiot wearing the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, speaking of looking like an idiot...
Your hat is crying.
Just dripping.
You know what it looks like now? It looks like E-Rock was tossing dough in a pizzeria, and it fell and landed on his head. Yes.
Like an old I Love Lucy episode.
Yes. E-Rock, we're losing you.
You
barely
right,
can see at this
can
point.
Can you hear?
What?
Yeah, you can't really hear very well.
How are you going to get that out of your ears?
Your rear?
This wasn't really well thought through.
I think if you go outside and let it harden a little bit, maybe
then
you have
could
a
just
chance.
Rip it right off your head.
Yeah.
Ouch.
That'd work.
Yeah.
Ooh, David goes, ouch.
Ouch.
Like it might hurt. And Danny just shakes his head in what can only be described as utter disgust. But utter disgust.
But Danny, you do know that, you know.
that he's an ass.
Yeah, I get it. During his interview, I let him say four words, and I was like, we have to take this guy. Yeah. But that doesn't mean I have to enjoy him as a person.
But you have to have a soft spot because, you know.
I get it.
We're not stupid. There's,
I get it, though.
You know.
Yeah, something going on.
You know.
I get it.
All right.
He's radio.
The old LD.
He's Radio Goldberg.
You gotta get...
Radio Goldberg. gotta...
See, that's what he does. That's it right there. Why is that funny, David?
This is a funny thing, because I'm a Jew. It's funny.
You got to grade on a curve, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
I'm all
We're
for
very
him
charitable.
On the show, but okay. As individuals, I don't have to enjoy
all right,
it.
You right.
Know after the show ends, it's like Danny still got to deal with him.
We lost D-Rock officially.
Oh, God, it's going over his mouth. Imagine if he suffocated because of it. It went over his mouth and nose.
It'll never make it to his chin if it's passing his mouth.
Wow, you can see all his facial features through the fluff, though. It's kind of creepy.
That is weird. It's creepy.
It's like a cat.
A hole is forming by his left eye, which is completely
because he keeps blinking.
You're like one of those tumor people now.
I'm Tree Man.
Yeah. Just like it, only white. Just don't spit. It's good. You're spitting it at me.
He's making an eye hole by blinking a lot. We're getting eye. All right.
Swallow it.
Finally, Ed. Finally. We got some good news coming out of Iraq. I think you're going to love this little story.
Yeah.
There's a statue mm-hmm. that's honoring Bush.
That's good. He liberated them, I guess. Mm-hmm. We didn't want to, but okay. Mm-hmm.
Residents of Tikrit,
yeah.
The hometown of Saddam Hussein. Mm-hmm. There's a picture of them laughing it up around a new statue honoring shoe thrower, blah, 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 blah.
That guy.
They got a statue of a shoe.
Oh, they've built a shoe statue
to honor
the guy that threw his shoes at George Bush.
Yeah, and they're having a good old time with that whole thing.
That's good. You know, I wonder what would have happened if he honored a shoe had it been thrown at Saddam when he was there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's right. He'd probably have his genitals taken off with a spade shovel. Whatever.
Just having a little fun with the shoe throwing incident.
That's all right. Have a field day, Iraqis. I know they listen, by the way. Have a field day there, Iraqis. when the troops do leave.
Yeah.
Just have fun trying to defend yourself against the influx of just extremists and civil war that will be going on there. It's going to be fun to watch all of you getting killed, pretty much, because the shoe statue, it'll be a fond little memory while some people that don't like you, that believe in the same thing, only slightly different, come into your house and kill your whole family. There you go. Which should have been happening in the first place.
Mm.
Tell you the truth, because we shouldn't have been there to liberate those people. But
I agree.
Whatever. Have fun. It's going to be it's really going to be fun news out of Iraq when the troops do leave. Ew, get away from me, sticky man. In a woman's...
In this Wonder Woman outfit.
Wonder Woman outfit.
You're just tuning in. You missed a lot today. We're going to do a little mopping up next. Opie and Anthony, stay there. Yeah, we're wrapping up. We had a real good week of fun.
Yes.
E-Rock can't see right now.
That looks so cool. It's moldy. I want to slap it on his face.
Now he's getting kind of that Leonidas helmet thing going. It's a fluff Roman war helmet.
Do you hear E-Rock?
He doesn't even know where to look.
Are you having a problem with that thing right there or what?
A little bit.
Is it like kind of happening?
What?
Is it the things?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you're screwing with me. No.
The things. I
don't know. That was excellent improv.
All right, let's get out of here. You got the Super Bowl Sunday. You got Jimmy's tickets going on sale in a couple minutes here for the Tower Theater in Philly.
Yes, at 9 a.m., LiveNation.com. It goes on sale in about 2 minutes.
Those tickets are going to sell very fast. And doing anything fun over the weekend?
I'm just hanging out, man. I got no plans, man. I'm just going to, Do nothing.
I'm looking for a cool place to see the Super Bowl.
Call of Duty.
Yeah.
Probably play some Call of Duty. Yeah. Some movies. Yeah. Some beers.
Yeah.
I don't care about the Super Bowl, like I said, so, yeah.
You'll take a little peek, though?
Just me on Pal Talk, probably.
Okay.
I like my virtual friends. They're easy.
They're easy to deal with.
I could just hit, like, the button, and they're gone. I don't have to say goodbye. I don't have to do anything. It's great.
It is kind of nice. All right. Music marathon time. What do we got?
What are we starting off with?
Today?
Yeah.
We got...
Is that the Leonidas helmet?
Yes, it is.
That is... Yeah, it was looking like that.
How do you even know that?
Ah, because I've watched that movie 8,000 times. It's one of my favorites.
I just know it as the helmet from that movie.
From 300 pounds.
This is delicious!
What are you doing, Rocky?
Rock, why are you near me? You're scaring me.
Yeah. All right, what's the first song?
I get sticky.
First up is Whole Lot of Love by Led Zeppelin.
A lot of love by Zeppelin.
You know that one.
Because you
right?
got to do the lead lunch thing.
You ever hear that one? It's pretty good.
Yeah, I'm thinking what Zeppelin song I want to hear instead.
That's a rather popular
Let's
number.
Do a little. Tangerine's good. What do you want to hear, Ant? What Zeppelin song would you
Zeppelin?
Like to hear?
Zeppelin?
You're not a Zeppelin fan.
Although,
I mean, you're.
Dancing days.
But you hear that one a lot too, though.
Yeah. E-Rock, what are you doing?
And if I say to you tomorrow, boom, that kind of a little too slow.
Huh?
I believe he's trying to pull off the fluff with the cape.
Oh,
why are you pulling
luck.
Off? I thought you were walking XM like
we're going to do.
You're not walking XM like that.
Telly Savalas ass.
No.
All right, play the song they got scheduled, I guess.
Wow.
I can't
stick around and listen to a song
How disgusting
today.
This is going to be.
What is he?
He's trying to pull it
he's
off.
He's trying to get it off,
tape,
no.
And it's hurting so bad.
You should have to do this at XM. This is silly.
Ah,
dude,
it's not coming off that way. You need really hot water and hope it melts off.
Hurry up, just run a comb through, you'll be fine.
Run a comb? Yeah, that'll work. Come on.
Style.
What is he trying to do? Is any coming out?
The excess is coming off.
Now, very... Oh.
Is that uncomfortable, E-Rock?
Peel it off.
Peel off the...
No, you gotta walk the streets.
Shut up, David.
E-Rock, you're not happy with David?
Whoa.
Oh.
He may be, but he's not a potty mouth, is he?
Yeah, he won't be on the dump sheet today.
You look like Divine.
How long is it my time of dying? Patrick Menachie wants to hear that one. That's a good one, man. That might be too long, though.
Yeah, that is way too
I know, it's a long song. Sorry, Pat.
How about some Carousalambra?
That's a kind of a cool song, but you know what? We don't even... Oh, In the Evening. Is the In the Evening as long as the one they're going to play?
Hang on, I'll tell you right now. Hang on.
What are you doing, E-Rock?
He can't get the Wonder Woman headband off his head.
Good.
Of course, big fat head.
Nah, In the Evening's a little longer.
I love that All sound.
Right. All right, they're gonna play their Zeppelin song. We got to go. We'll see you guys Monday. Have a great weekend if you're not joining us over at SiriusXM.
Smells delicious, though.
Well, what do you call that snack? It's a failure.
We'll see you guys Monday. All right, Opie and Anthony continuing with the program. For the newbies out there, you're going to now hear a little more cursing, because we're allowed to do that now.
Yeah.
It makes it so much better.
Yeah.
Where's intern David? Where's, hey, David! And I hear the moans out there, don't worry. This is a quickie. David, we got a very big crowd today. A nice-sized crowd.
Yeah, really.
The crowds were down this week. We had a few listeners here, a few listeners there, but the Friday show gets a lot of listeners to come by and check it out, David.
Oh, certainly does.
And we want you. This is your new job as executive intern. When you're here and you see a crowd, I want you to work the crowd behind the scenes to see if they have anything that we could bring to the radio show. Okay?
Okay, sounds good.
So you go out there and you kind of...
you kind of work the crowd a little bit and go, hey, hi, I'm intern David. I'm the executive intern of the Opie and Anthony Show. Make sure you say that. And then you see if they have anything they could bring to the show.
Okay.
All right?
Sounds good to me.
All right, go.
Okay.
Thank God it sounds good to him.
Yeah.
Have fun, Dave.
What an ass he is, man.
Wow, how does someone get 133,000 points on Brick Breaker?
Nolan?
Is that a high or good score?
That's a good score, and your name is really fucked up for Boston, so I can't even give you credit. Stinny K. Durson, Skinny Anderson, something.
Skinny Anderson?
I don't know.
One thing you know it's not is Skinny Nagel.
The guy's got 20 lives left. God damn, is that good. Sam, is he? What is he doing?
Well, he's just starting to interview people and just find out. He said, wow, one person is from New Orleans.
Okay.
Oh,
that's the first fun fact. This is Travis from New Orleans that we're meeting.
Okay.
That gets a wow from him?
Yes.
All right, so David's going to work the audience, and then we'll find out in about 15 minutes what he has come up with.
Suggestions. 15 minutes per person, knowing David.
Oh,
but
my
yes.
God. No.
Jesus Christ.
I want to report back to David in 15 minutes, Sam.
15 minutes.
So you can supervise David as he works the crowd. We're going to turn the audience mic off a little while so David could do his magic as executive intern.
David.
All right. Hey, we were talking about the snakehead fish.
Yeah.
We got some audio. The invasion of the snakeheads.
That's the one that stands up?
Yeah, by the way, you're lying about them marching toward Macy's. Oh, my God.
They not? Why would they not?
Oh, those are the Japanese fish. Those are the ones
they're called snakeheads.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we found the official name.
Sizzling on the hot pavement.
Yeah. Yeah, but these things are just a nuisance and a danger. And the National Geographic did a whole thing on the snakehead fish.
Did they?
And we got a couple quick clips to go through.
Frightened.
Are you frightened?
Very frightened.
I've never seen one. They've never affected my life. So I don't give a fuck about them.
What are the snakes that will raise up
Stunt Brain
in prayer? Praise his name.
Why are you still listening?
Oh, no.
Christian Jimmy.
Oh, Christian Jimmy.
That's all I got. One line.
All right.
Well,
look at that.
Hold on. Who is that? Who is fucking Quick Finger Madraw?
Madraw?
Oh, yeah. Did I say Madraw? Exactly, because McGraw wouldn't do it. Only McGraw would.
McGraw.
Quick Finger McGraw.
I got an answer to my question. Tim H. from Columbus. One gets 133,000 on Brick Breaker by never having sex.
At least
snacks. I got the answer to my question. I don't know. Stump Brain's not around anymore. Maybe we could get him on the phone, but some dumb snake that's eating everything, eating all the birds in Guam or something. Maybe a listener can help us out with that. But this is invasion of the snakeheads. Very scary, these fishies.
There's a new invader on the block.
Mm.
A ferocious fish with a massive appetite and razor-sharp teeth. It may even walk on land. The snakehead.
It represents an introduction of something that can compete and possibly outcompete the native fishes.
Yeah, like I said, I never seen one.
Yeah, but eventually this is going to affect you. Don't you understand? It's a delicate ecosystem out there.
It's like, no, it isn't.
Very delicate.
For some reason, I think people think of the ecosystem is a lot more delicate than it is.
I'm not worried about the snakehead fish. I'm with you. But the honeybees, there's something going on with the bees, and then eventually it's not going to be good for us humans.
In the summer, there's bees everywhere.
Right. But according to the experts, not as many bees as there used to be.
Yes, then there's a reason for that.
For our food supply.
We don't.
Yes, we do.
I go to the supermarket.
I know.
And I see food everywhere.
But eventually.
It's amazing.
You're not going to see as much food.
The food I see everywhere.
And then there's going to be zombies on the street because now.
Oh, don't even tempt me. I would adore a zombie invasion.
Yeah, you'd be the
shooter. Oh, would that be come to my house, motherfucker?
You would be the leader that we would all follow.
Oh, would that be fun?
I would
do something original. I would go to the mall.
Yeah.
And, no?
That's not no. Zombies people in the mall.
Oh, of course. That's where they all go.
Well, what's your game plan for a zombie invasion, though?
Beat them or burn them. Shoot them in the head. Yeah, zombie invasion?
Mm-hmm.
I'd hold up in my house. Of course, you got to batten down the hatches, do a lot of work keeping The doors secure downstairs. Get everyone upstairs.
I
get
saw
yourself
I
your,
too,
your last ditch effort.
Yeah.
And then get enough people over your house where they can cover with interlocking fields of fire to cover the entire premises. And then you just pick them off as they come. Hope they enjoy Jewish dishes for dinner. It's in my neighborhood. So hopefully, you know, build up a taste for Hebrew people.
Before you?
And, yeah, they don't want the Catholic on the block. Yeah, zombie invasion would be a dream come true for me.
Hold on a minute. We got Josh in Philly. Josh!
Yeah, morning, boys.
Good morning, Josh.
Jimmy.
Thank you, sir, so much.
I got the name of that fish for you. It's the one that eats everything. It's the E-Rock fish.
Ah,
poor E-Rock. He hasn't done enough for this show today. Thank you, sir. Let's say hi to Nate in Vegas. Nate?
Yeah, if Dave is the executive intern, can I be the executive listener?
Hmm.
So you want an executive listener today, Ant? It's really your decision.
You know something? It's probably as useful a title as executive intern.
I'm looking for a job, so I already put it on my resume.
Oh, you did? Yeah, okay. If you put it on your resume, then let's give him the executive listener position.
Sam, you got a mic?
Hello? Yeah.
Hold on there, Nate. We got Nate on the phone, Sam. He wants to be executive listener.
Oh, that's something I'd have to clear with David.
So where is David? As executive intern, I want to see if there's something here. Where's David?
Right here.
I'm
David.
Right here.
David, there's Nate from Vegas. He's on the phone, and he wants to be executive listener. Is that a good idea?
What would he do as executive listener?
That's why we're asking you as executive intern. What would an executive listener do?
I don't know about that executive listener.
Huh?
I don't know about that executive listener.
He said he'd do about as much as you do, which is nothing. So it's just the title.
Whoa.
Whoa. What the fuck was that noise?
I don't think so. I don't like this guy.
Well, no, you can't judge it on not liking somebody. That's, discrimination. You got to look at his qualifications. Sir, how long have you been listening?
I started listening to you guys in Vegas when you were here on terrestrial radio, and then I bought XM just to keep you guys going.
All right, he's qualified for the job as a listener.
He's been listening a while, David. What do you want him to do as an executive listener? Give him some chores.
Well, as executive listener, he'd have to...
Oh, my God. He had to stop talking as somebody put headphones on him. He completely stopped talking, waited for the headphones to be put on him, and then continued talking. He couldn't talk as the headphones were being put on.
He doesn't like to be touched. I told you guys that already. So that was something touching him, which freaks him out. But now he's okay because it's not a touching thing anymore. David?
Yes.
Give this guy some chores.
If he was executive listener, then he'd have to prove that he was listening all every day by calling in every single day.
No.
Could you do that, sir?
Absolutely.
All right, you have to call every day. That's your first job as executive listener.
Every single day he has to call in over here at the XM side, every single day.
Now, David, there's Derek in New York City who wants to be the senior executive listener.
Oh, wow.
Oh, does he have more years of listening experience than this other Vegas guy?
Well, that's a very good question. Nate, how many years, and don't lie, because we'll...
Don't lie or I'll know.
No. No.
Two and a half
years. All right, hold on a minute. We got Derek from New York City. Derek, how long have you been listening to the program?
B-A-B.
B-A-B years?
Wow.
Why, are you just lying?
No.
Prove that you've been listening since the B-A-B years.
Uh-oh.
Please don't do it.
Do it.
What? I'm sorry?
Prove that you've been listening since the B-A-B years.
Oh, God. Do we have to go, we'll go with the brawl bombs?
No, that was AAF.
That was a tell, my friend.
XM, man. Ever since you started on XM, that's when I started listening.
Lying sack of shit.
Boo. All right, he can't be a senior executive.
Okay, so I guess Las Vegas wins. Sorry.
All right. So far, Nate, your first job is to call every day as executive listener. And then David will give you more chores after that, I guess. He starts them off easy, I guess.
Yeah.
You call in every single day. And when you call in every single day, you have to comment on one specific story that O and A are talking about to prove that you really are listening.
All right.
How come you don't have to do anything to prove that you're doing anything as executive intern?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Oh, my God.
I wasn't thinking
is...
Holy shit, Sam had to hit him to get him to talk.
I know.
Because he'll just ponder. He'll just ponder a question, even though it's radio.
Well, Sam's his handler.
Yeah, he really is.
All right, get back to work in the crowd there, Dave. We're going to check in with you in about 10 minutes.
Can I ask David a question, though, Dave?
Yeah.
Yes, Jay.
I think in response to Opie's question, it was an Ant's question about what do you have to do to prove what you do. I think that basically the proof's in the pudding, as we say, is what your on-air performance.
Okay.
Way to sell it. Wow.
Sam is a handler. How old do you have to let a Jew get before you can set him on his own as a handler? Born Friedman.
Can you just set up your own brilliant line?
I set it up myself.
I just want to acknowledge that.
I'll set my own table and then eat.
You knew you had a really good line, but you just needed someone to get you there.
He's the Abbott and the Costello.
Holy shit. We can't let that one slide.
Yeah, I know. I'm a greedy bastard.
Not to say it wasn't a good line,
selfish.
But maybe you could have, like, I don't know, written a little note and said, can someone help me here?
Help me out here. Henry. Trying to do a Jew joke, Henry.
Jew boy, prejudice against Italians.
In this day and age. Yeah.
All right, David, go back to work in the crowd. We're going to Chris in Pennsylvania.
Charisma he's got.
Yeah, Chris.
Hey, guys, I saw something yesterday that I think you'd appreciate. I was driving around and I saw a half-shoveled property at a house with a snow shovel slightly askew propped up on the snow.
Yeah.
And then on the other side of the house, there's an ambulance loading someone into it. And then I couldn't stop but laugh about that. And then this morning I read in the paper he died of a heart attack.
Jesus!
What the hell? What do you think?
Sir.
The other day you talk about what has been ruined by you guys in our lives, and for some reason I feel no compassion and just find stuff like that.
he's compassionless because of this show. All right. Well, as long as they've done
kind of
something.
What do you think we are?
Compassionless idiots.
An executive producer or an executive listener also, because I even got the BlackBerry to listen to you guys when I'm doing calls, fixing copiers.
Yeah. Do you think you finished the rest of the job, or you just let it sit there?
Leave it.
Yeah.
Why bother?
Well, if the guy dies, are you doing his job?
He died shoveling his own driveway, it looks like.
Just leave it.
That happens to a lot of people.
Why shovel? Just plow right through with your vehicle. Get in your car and just drive shoveling.
All right, thank you, sir. That was a fun little story for Friday. All right, back to the snakehead fish.
They're very scary.
Yeah.
A northern snakehead reaches sexual maturity by age 2 or 3.
Ah, yeah.
Each spawning ape can release.
They're like people.
Oh, no, they're not, Uncle Paul. That's terrible.
They're two different things, Paul.
Not different. Amber understands.
Oh, no, she doesn't.
She never understands.
And she doesn't like your snakefish either.
Who is that girl? I see her name. Amber Alliot. She's really cute, I bet.
No, I believe that's Amber Alert. See, you're...
Oh.
I also believe that's an awful joke.
Hard to wordplay with alert. I should executive produce the show. I ruined things.
Someone has thrown the name out, Doug Yule.
Wow, okay. Now that guy, that's somebody that knows.
That guy should be senior executive. Listener, Doug Yule was probably my first intern in radio, and he's now a successful musician. I was just looking him up the other day.
Yeah,
he's doing very well in Woodstock, New York, doing his music.
Woodstock,
but he started on the BAB show. So that guy becomes senior executive listener. Zagman, actually,
your assistant to the assistant senior executive listener.
That was a good call right there. Back to the snakehead fish.
A northern snakehead reaches sexual maturity by age 2 or 3. Each spawning age female can release up to 15,000 eggs at once.
Hot.
Snakeheads can mate as often
as
5 times
a year. That's a lot of kicks in the stomach.
You have to make a machine that just like it's like a fucking a robot thing with a shoe on it that just goes duck,
just
duck.
He's booting her in the old belly.
That's a lot of kicks to the stomach. You have to get a bunch of MMA guys and do it in shifts.
Right.
All right.
Snakeheads can mate as often as 5 times a year. This means in just 2 years.
As often as 5 times
often.
A year.
Often.
What are they married couples?
That's horrible.
Oh, It's not too often at all.
This announcer is really jaded. Do you believe how lucky they are? They get to fuck five times a year.
Five times a year.
Year. This means
as opposed to cicadas, I guess that's great.
Yeah, was that every 20 years?
Cicada dumps one load, then 17 years later he crawls out of the dirt. That's got to suck.
Or the dumb panda.
The pandas never fuck.
They don't, right?
What?
The male just jerks off in the female's ear and then laughs with his friends. A lot of people, the scientists didn't know that for a long time, but the male panda is a jerk-off freak, and he enjoys humiliating the female by coming on her face and ears.
The panda's it's a disaster, right?
Yeah, it is.
Or it's doing a lot.
It's very hard in captivity to make them mate.
Make them have a baby, yeah. Are they having sex, though?
I think you got to jerk them off into a petri dish and have her squat in it or some shit.
No, what happens is a lot of times the female will come in while the panda's eating like a cantaloupe and a banana, and she'll just suck the panda's dick, and then fucking she'll take it, and then while the female is sleeping, you open those little fat panda legs, you just go, you spit it in, and you wish for the best.
Fat panda legs, huh?
You grab those little fat panda legs.
Or chubby.
And you'll hold her up on her back and you go, and you shake the semen down into her. Old panda cum. These are awful. Tastes like Sanka.
Let's go to Chris in Canada. Chris?
And a Chris.
Chris.
Yeah, I'm phoning in to apply for the position of Senior Executive International Listener.
Oh.
You know what? We have listeners all over the world, so Canada is sort of America.
I would say
we need someone from far away. We've had calls from Jerusalem, Japan.
And I don't like the title. I like senior executive listener
abroad.
International Bureau.
Ah, nice.
Yeah.
I don't think we could give it to a Canadian.
No,
I really don't. I'm really sorry.
No.
Mary in Jerusalem. Mary.
Hi, I would like to be executive secretary to the executive intern.
Some Monty Python bit.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
You want to have babies?
All right, we'll get an international listener. What is the title?
International rep. We need a
We need an executive listener. International Bureau, or International Desk.
Yeah.
All right.
Surprising to see so many guys out there, not a lot of girls.
Yeah.
It is a surprise. Yeah. It's usually so many hot chicks come in and sit on those bleachers. Yeah.
Just amazing how many we get usually.
Those bleachers just get pushed back at the end of the day, smell like musky ass.
I was just thinking of that. They smell like asshole and onions.
Yeah.
Fucking awful. French onion soup. That's what our fucking bleachers smell like. Bunch of sweaty, nervous guys, puckering assholes. Hoping to fucking bang the one chick in the stands.
How about we do this, ladies' night? Or ladies' day?
Ladies' day on Friday?
Next Friday's ladies' day.
All right, you could just put the bleachers away.
Exactly.
No, how about we do this? You're not even allowed in unless you bring a lady. Kind of like the bar scenario.
Oh, okay, so the guys bring the lady. Well, that's bad because then this guy's with the ladies.
Ah,
that's down on the possibilities.
Got to bring a sister or a mother or an aunt.
Aunt.
No wives or girlfriends.
We'll have the guys filling out so much paperwork it won't even matter.
Little sisters. Bring your little sister.
Bring your kid sis.
Ladies' Day next Friday. Mm. Or we don't let you in.
Braces. Got to have braces. I don't care. Teeth or legs.
Doesn't matter. Preferably both.
Yeah.
So you can fucking put a magnet on your ankle and then hook your teeth to it and fuck you while you're bent over.
Jesus.
That's the best part.
Back to the snakeheads. We're never going to get... We got four more clips to go here.
What?
5 times a year. This means in just 2 years, a single female can release up to 150,000 eggs. In a natural habitat where predators and prey work in balance, fast breeding's kept in check. But in a foreign ecosystem where natural predators are missing, it can lead to a disastrous population explosion.
Oh, and that's where the problem is, Antsy. That's where it's going to affect you eventually.
Wow.
No predator. What?
Spinner shark. Look at this thing.
Now look, it's spinning in a circle. Those are the gay sharks.
The gay sharks.
They just come out of the water, they spin in a circle, and they go back down.
It really is just flying out of the water, spinning around.
Why is it spinning?
They do that occasionally. They don't know why.
Because they're not happy.
They breach.
Sharks do this breaching thing like whales do, but they're not supposed to.
It's to probably shake whatever's on there off.
Mm. Oh, that's good. Those pilot fish that they get on them.
Yeah, they have pilot fish and things.
Little leeches.
They probably want to shake those things off so they can come right back on in 3 seconds as soon as they hit the water. Dumb sharks.
It's probably pollution that we, you know.
Well, they got to get that off of them.
Yeah. They're fucking
I think it's to show how badass he is and don't fucking come in the water. I'll bite you.
Yeah.
They're very, very dangerous.
Good point.
Snakeheads are also known to lash out at any who approach them. Of the 29 known snakehead varieties, many, like the giant snakehead, are powerful hunters with ravenous appetites and sharp, snapping jaws. Jaws that can tear flesh, even human flesh.
They're exaggerating.
At first, I wasn't quite sure what bit me.
So I put a wedding dress on it and stuck my dick in its mouth. And then I shit on its fins and blocked out its pubic hair.
What kind of language is he speaking?
Some
Japanese, I believe.
Was it?
Who could tell?
Even human flesh.
We pixelate the pubes away from the fish.
I saw a lot of blood on my arm. I thought I was lucky it didn't hurt me that much. They can bite your entire hand off.
Then my wife, Heather, had the same thing happen to her. She tried to put her tootsie in the fish's mouth.
Fucking idiot, probably wrapped it in seaweed and rice and ate it. Dummy.
Hey, Dan, how big is it? Can we Google these fish and see how big they are?
Google.
Yeah, they're nasty looking.
They really are, but are they piranha-sized? I like the way they go flesh, even human flesh.
Even human.
Like, we go, what? Really? We thought it was other creatures, not us.
Yeah.
Our flesh is, we get paper cuts, it hurts.
Should we continue with this? Snakeheads lashing out, giant snakeheads, jaws that can tear flesh. We did that one.
You know what? I can tell by this, they're over-exaggerating.
Just because
this
music?
Thing hunts. And tears like flesh off of a fucking frog or some shit.
Right.
And it's like, even human flesh. Mm-hmm. And they talk to some guy that got bit and he's bleeding on his arm.
But
like Jimmy said, you know, we get fucking a little nothing and we're bleeding.
They're saying they could devastate a food chain, though.
Yeah, by like fucking shit up.
In the U.S., the bees. Snakehead attacks are just a small part of their danger. To an ecosystem, invading snakeheads pose a far greater threat.
Do they?
Outside its natural habitat, the northern variety can decimate a food chain.
These fish are top-level predators that will eat virtually anything in their path. They can travel across land and live out of water for
Drive cars.
Yes, they have Winnebagos, where there's 3,000 of them piled in.
They make it sound like these things are such a fucking threat.
Exactly. They're a member of the Delta Sky Team, and they trade frequent flyer miles.
Never seen one.
Out of water for up to 3 days.
On land, snakeheads use a primitive lung above their gills.
Ah,
they have
nice.
These air chambers just up underneath.
Mutants! Waterworld.
That air is forced up into those air chambers. In many respects, like a lung.
All right, we're not.
Wow, they could
anybody?
Breathe in out of the water. That's the most amazing thing. Fuck the teeth. Fuck their thing. Fuck everything. They can breathe out of the water and in the water.
For how long though can they breathe out of the water? Did they say?
25 years.
They're on the board of many condos in New York City.
Thank you, Kenny.
25 years.
This guy John had a snakehead. Seven years ago, he had a snakehead fish. So let's get some answers.
What happened?
John.
You still got the motherfucker? Or did you eat like a catfish?
Oh, John talking, Jimmy.
Mm-hmm. Sorry. Yeah, we're getting them all today.
Shut up, he tells you.
All right, what's your name?
John, it was John from White House State.
Hey, John.
I owned one of these snakeheads 7 years ago. They're not overestimating them. I bought it. It was 3 inches long. In 15 months, it grew to be 42 inches. I mean, if you put your finger in, you were losing your finger.
What did you put it in at 42 inches long?
His pants. And then it walked away. Went and got a job at Bradley's. He was the floor manager at Bradley's.
Stupid Bradley's.
Yeah, I had him in a 150-gallon fish tank. He outgrew the tank. And I mean, it was just this monster fishing area.
Crawl out. You get up for work. He's taking a shit on the bowl, reading the paper.
He's hanging over the edge. I mean, the guy who stands outside the fucking little castle has been hung.
You
plow right ahead with the facts.
A goldfish should be gone in a minute or less.
Well, why would you put other fish in there?
Exactly.
Of course, it's called food to him.
You gotta eat.
How big? 42 inches, dude. That's 3 feet.
Yeah, over 3 feet.
Three and a half.
In a 150-gallon tank? Come on, you're bullshitting me.
No, they're six. This 150-gallon tank is it's 6 foot long, 2 feet high, and 24 inches wide. He could barely. He
2 feet wide and 24 inches high.
That's a big difference.
So it's 2 feet high and 2 feet wide.
It's a box.
You're a dummy.
He threw him in a UPS box made of glass.
Nah, man, we used to feed them. We'd feed them mice, rats, huge frogs.
I'm surprised the mouse didn't drink the water when you threw it in.
How many fucking days?
Anyway, I ended up.
He plows right through this guy. Anyway,
he doesn't care.
What's that, sir?
Every time you bought another fish, he would kill it instantly. Even though, I mean, piranhas are—they're little faggot fish. Well, we would eat them, and it looked like a shrimp tail floating around in a tank when it got done with.
Well, sir, piranhas are much smaller. I mean,
he does not care what you have to say, Jimmy.
Yes. Hey, brief pause only, guy. How many piranhas would you put in there at a time?
Yeah. We need
piranhas,
to know.
I had piranhas at the start, never so boring. You had to hide behind a couch for them to eat, so I got rid of them.
But how many would you put in? How many would you put in? And I mean, in metric tons, how many?
Piranhas, I had like a dozen of them, but they were so boring.
How big's a piranha?
Piranhas would be about the size of a pancake, a little smaller.
That's pretty silver, fucking big.
Silver dollar pancake. I like the Jack Dempsey's. I used to feed them spiders, and they would eat them, and the legs would. Like, wrap around a face like Alien.
Oh, really?
That was great.
Great restaurant to get picked up in front of. Sorry,
yes,
sir.
Jack Dempsey's. This is plow through every fucking word, guy.
Hold on. Well, hey, the Germans were gentler when cleaning out the Warsaw Ghetto than you are in this conversation.
Jesus.
That's where I went wrong.
You don't get what's going on here. This guy's been waiting years to be needed on this show.
Yeah.
This is the day. This is his opportunity.
Yeah, so you're trying to get in a lot of years of knowledge into a 30-second conversation.
Yeah.
Knowledge no one gives a shit about.
Yeah, we just want to know if we're going to be able to survive with these dumb snakehead fish that are marching around.
And what'd you do with it? Flush it down the toilet? It's in the sewers now.
I wanted a local lake, so I ended up, I put him in a 100-quart cooler. He was in there for 6 months with an air bubble thing going. That's it. And I'd feed him once in a while, and then a buddy of mine took him, put him in his tank with his African cichlid. And last time I saw him, he only had a snakehead living in there.
So the snakehead adapts to land. How far can they go on land?
I don't know how far they can go on land, but he lived in a cooler that I never changed the water. I only added water in a cooler.
Yeah. All right, we got it.
Oh, yeah, we understand.
And a cooler.
So you're saying cooler like it's fucking, like it's fishnet stockings. Right. If he lives 6 months in a pair of fishnet stockings or a hairnet, I'd be shocked.
Right. Yeah, it's a cooler with water in it. Exactly. Wow, a fish lived in water?
You know, in a cooler?
Preposterous.
Which is meant to keep liquids in? You don't say.
You're living in a closet. You can't even turn around.
Yeah, I got it, sir, but you're saying like it's a
now
fucking...
you're talking about Steve.
Hey, did you say that your friend put him in with African cichlids?
Yeah, they are.
Isn't this a freshwater fish and cichlids a saltwater fish?
Oh! No. Oh.
Cichlids are freshwater fish. Go do your research.
I think I will, because I think you're wrong.
I think Danny did his research.
Yeah, he's the one with...
On the saltwater after that.
Why did he throw that fish in with delicious gum?
I wish I could
hate
him.
You?
Why? I love a good Raz joke. Oh, I'm sorry, Chicklets. Remember Raz gum was multicolored and sugary?
Yeah.
I just remember Razzles. Is it a gum or is it a candy? We don't fucking know.
That's right. What was it? It was a weapon. I would fucking hide them in the freezer and throw them at the eyes of retarded children. Come on. Fucking thinking on my feet here. Not doing well.
All right. You get all your knowledge out because we got to move on there, John.
Yeah, that's about it.
Enough about your snake fish.
Right. Thanks, John. All right, you know what? This snakehead fish thing isn't going anywhere. Let's move on.
I think it's pretty cool, though.
Screw
I mean,
the rest of the clips.
3.5 fucking feet long? Dude, that's a fucking massive fish.
And they walk on land, and they adapt. Yes.
They're like slinkies.
All right.
I'm going to start a show called The Snakefish Whisperer. I train wayward snakefishes. My snakefish eats everything I put in the tank. I don't know what to do.
Oh, Ted.
That's right. I'm Ted the snakefish owner. I don't know what to do. He's fucked my wife too when I'm away at work.
You're a cuckold for a snakefish.
He uses my slippers as his own.
When he walks around your house.
Yeah, that's how you know when your newspaper's damp and your slippers are outside the fish tank. You're like, I know what he's been up to.
I'm not stupid, right?
Yeah, your fucking refrigerator door handle is smelly and slippery. It smells like fish. And all your fish food's gone. That'd be an indicator.
We're going to take a break because we got to find out what intern David came up with.
Oh, yeah.
He's been working in the audience.
What he's called from the audience.
Yeah, big audience on the bleachers. I don't know if the mic's on. Oh, it's inside here. That's the problem. That's why we're not getting a crowd reaction.
Yeah, we did tell him to put it in.
Okay, no worries. So we'll find out if David got anything for the show by using the listeners. He just worked them for a while. Stay there.
I got it.
Opie and Anthony. Big crowd outside. I think their mic's on, finally. We're going to check in with intern David to see if any of those guys have anything for the radio show today. But first, calling from L.A., I do believe, Bill Burr. Bill!
What's up, man?
Bill Burr. I was very happy to look over to my right on the phones and see that you were sitting there waiting to talk to us.
You know what? Yeah, I'm sitting out here in my hybrid out in Los Angeles.
Hybrid.
And you thought of Anthony?
No, you know what's been bugging me is, you know, I trashed the ShamWow back in the day. I actually had to give not 100% detraction, but I wasn't quite using the product correctly.
Oh, wait a minute. Now, what happened? Because I always, anytime anyone crows about the ShamWow, which, by the way, in popular mechanics, they did a whole thing on 10 seen-on-TV products. And the ShamWow got a huge, stunning review.
I read that very same article, and I was very surprised to see the ShamWow getting decent reviews.
One moment, Mr. Burr. All I've been saying is, well, Bill Burr got it, and he said the plastic it came in was more absorbent than the ShamWow, I believe was your quote. So what has happened to change your tune?
I was walking through a mall, and I'm seeing this guy demonstrating the ShamWow to all these idiots. And he's got the little Janet Jackson headset on, just like the guy in the commercial.
Yeah.
And I was just like, you got to be kidding me. I'm going to heckle this guy.
He's heckling a guy in a wall.
And I'm going to tell everybody what a fraud this product is. So he starts wiping stuff up, and I start heckling him. Telling everybody that the thing's basically a piece of crap and it doesn't work. And I was waiting for him to completely implode, and he didn't. He calmly asked me to come over, and he goes, here, let me show you how to... Evidently, you have to get the ShamWow... This doesn't make any sense, but you have to get the ShamWow wet first.
Yes, it's a chamois. If you've ever used a chamois, which they're normally for years have been used to dry top-end cars.
Shut your face.
And what you do is you get it damp. I use a chamois on my Mustang.
You're an expert on chamois?
On chamois. Just because you put a wow at the end of it doesn't mean it's a different fucking animal. It's a chamois.
Yeah, how come you didn't say this when I was bitching about it 2 months ago?
I didn't watch you use it.
You know what? You're one of those Wikipedia guys. you just look this shit up, and now you're just spitting it back at me like you're some sort of professor.
I have a chamois in my garage this very second that I use on my Mustang when I wash it.
I'd like to stuff one of those in your mouth and get all this saliva out of your mouth so you can
Well, it probably wouldn't work because you'd use it wrong.
Oh!
Sticking in dry. Ooh, that sounds sexy.
Yeah, so sure it does. Teach him who's boss.
So, Bill, you have to get the thing wet. This guy's showing you in front of a lot of people at the mall.
You have to get it wet, but I got to admit, it still doesn't absorb a fish tank's worth of water, but it definitely works better.
So are you saving paper towels?
No, I'm still buying paper towels.
Yeah, I went through, I was thinking of you. See, we think of each other when we do horrific things that we know would upset the other one.
Yeah.
I was taking a beer out of the fridge, of course, and another one decided to follow the one I had in my hand out and fell on the floor and just exploded. And instead of using a towel, a sponge, or anything, I used an entire roll of paper towels. A giant roll, and just went frr, 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 all over the floor. So it covered the entire thing, and then kind of picked up everything, the water, the glass, whatever dirt was on the floor at the time. And all I thought is I'm carrying this giant
It looked like a big paper mache float head over to the garbage was. Bill Burr would be so pissed at me right now for wasting.
Yeah, he's a bit greener than you.
He is.
A little bit. I would have broken out in hives watching you do that.
Hey, Bill, what about... Yeah, go ahead.
I got to tell you guys this. Listen to this.
Yeah.
I got a rat problem.
Oh,
out
Jesus.
Here in L.A. I pulled my car into the garage. Like, you know, I come home late at night. And on cold nights, if it's kind of raining out here, evidently some... Can I curse on this?
Yes, you can.
Okay. Evidently, some fucking rat crawls up into my engine when it's still warm.
Ooh.
And it just snuggles up in there. I had no idea. I kept turning my car on, and I'm smelling like this urine smell.
It's pissing in your fucking, like, your heat duct.
The little fucking bastard. So I bring my little baggy hybrid down to the Toyota dealership, and they go,
You sure it wasn't the... You sure it was a rat and not the engine?
No, that's a hamster, Anthony.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Little rascals.
You know, cats will do that, too, with the engines. Mm-hmm. But go ahead. So you bring it down to the dealership?
Yeah, so they take me aside, and they say that I have rat droppings in my air conditioner
Holy
filter.
Shit.
That's hilarious.
Oh,
you're
man.
Breathing in rat duty.
Yeah, so I'm going to kill this fucking rat, right?
Yep.
So I go to the hardware store. You know those little glue traps that they have?
Well, the most humane of all rat traps.
Yes.
The
glue,
most evil ones. Yeah,
where they stay alive for a week.
Off. Why not hire 10 mice to stab it?
Yeah. I highly recommend the glue traps. A lot of fun to see the damn thing struggling. And I'm not an animal guy, but wow. When you see their ears stuck to the fucking glue.
Oh, it's great.
Rat,
their face is stuck.
And they're making noises you didn't think a rat could make.
Looks like E-Rock would fluff on his head.
Yeah. All right, so you got the glue traps there, Bill.
Yeah, because basically they scared the hell out of me saying somebody else had the same thing happen to their car, and the stupid rat crawled up in there, started chewing up wires, and basically disabled this entire hybrid. So I'm in a panic now that I'm going to lose a $22,000 car because of some fucking rat. So I buy, like, literally 30 of those fucking glue traps, and I just duct tape them to a cardboard box, and I just slid it underneath my car.
Don't tell me your car got stuck in the trap because it didn't have the power to fucking back out.
That's
because you drive.
That is great.
That's powerful.
You just killed the bitch.
No, come on.
No, listen. Mia, my girlfriend, stinks at driving. She's a typical city girl. She got her driver's license when she was like 36. You know?
Yeah.
So, I put the stupid trap things underneath the car, and she goes to go to the gym, and I'm in the apartment. I'm thinking, oh shit, I didn't tell her about the rat traps. I got to make sure I when she comes home, I put the car in the garage. And right before she drives in the driveway, I get a phone call. And as I'm getting off the phone, she comes walking in the back, and I'm like, freaking out, going, did you see the rat trap? She's like, yeah, no problem. I pull in. Dude, I go downstairs. She drove right over the fucking thing. I literally had to spend like 45 minutes on my knees in rat turds with this screwdriver trying to get this fucking thing off of my tire.
I just drove down the road like
shit.
That.
Two of them were stuck on my pathetic excuse for a fucking tire, and I was just sitting there. The words coming out of my mouth, it was brutal. I was just like, I'm buying a fucking Hummer. I don't give a shit. This doesn't happen to people who have real cars. I think I'm over the hybrid.
Yeah, you really should get over that. It's not... It really... I don't see it making much of a difference. Mm-hmm. Mate. You know, the price of gas is down.
Are you looking at Wikipedia again, Anthony?
No.
Are you scrolling down right now?
Anthonypedia. That's me.
Hey, Bill, you know they say if you have one rat, that means you have many rats.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
I learned that from Jim Norton because I came in here with a little mouse problem. I said, I got this dumb mouse in my apartment. Jimmy goes, if you have one, that means you have a lot. You're infested if you could see one.
Yep.
And sure enough, I had 60 kills under my belt before I moved out of that joint.
And you use the glue?
You know what? The glue really bothered me. You wake up in the morning and there's like a mama fucking mouse with a couple babies on its back all glued to the trap. I'm like, I can't deal with this. So I got the electric ones that zap them.
You gotta finish them off. That's the problem.
That's the problem.
Finish them off.
No, he's right though, because you can't just like throw them in the garbage and go, you know, you got to smash their little heads.
Some people do that because they don't have the nerve to kill the rat, so they just throw it into the garbage and prolong
the person's suffering. No, Bill makes a good point. If you're going to be brave enough to use the glue traps, you got to finish them off.
You got
to
finish them off.
You can't be a pussy.
You got to be like Commodus and give them the thumbs down and then go in there.
And I was smashing their little mouse heads with that. I forgot what I used, but it's awful.
I was going to call you and try to figure out because I after I put, you know, after my rage went down and I put the glue traps underneath my car, I was kind of thinking, like, man, some rats are, like, as big as a cat.
Yeah.
Like, how am I going to finish this thing off? You know, I don't have a gun. I'm not getting anywhere near it because I'm not going to get bit. I was thinking about getting, like, a sword or something.
Yeah, that would probably work from a distance. You could do that.
How about a medieval mace or maybe a suit of iron and a fucking horse?
Smash them.
Jesus. Fucking Bill, why don't you joust it?
Rats.
If it was a mouse, I could just put on some fucking work boots and step on the thing. But if it's a rat, you know?
Yeah.
Well, if you could get them on, like, if it's just one piece of that sticky stuff, you could use the old car. If you had a good car, you just put them under the tire and let old reverse do the dirty work.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, it's true.
Yeah.
Well, with my luck, somebody would film it, and then the cruelty to rat people would come over and start protesting. You know what?
Fuck them. Fuck them.
Yeah, you gotta live your life. You're living there, for fuck's sake. You're driving that car. You don't want rat piss and shit. You could get that fucking Hunter virus rat droppings.
My cheap fucking landlord to solve the problem, because my apartment's nice, but the garage, I swear to God, that the thing's from like 1935. Literally see through it. So he sends two people over here. Not only do they not even speak English, they got like this particle board that they're using to fill up some of the holes, and I swear to God, you know what? The guy's using a fucking, like a miter, not a miter saw, like a skill saw, and this is how broke the people were that he sent over here. You know what he's using for a sawhorse?
What?
His fucking thigh.
A what? His thigh?
Yeah, he had the board there, and it's slipping, and he's just using the skill saw. I had to look away.
This guy
is going to cut his fucking leg off.
Yeah, entertainment value at least.
No kidding.
Wow, that is that's creepy.
Bill, by the way, I think you did okay.
Bill, you called me. I apologize. I didn't call you back. I forgot. Then as soon as I heard you were on the phone, my shame hit me. I realized I never called you back, so I apologize.
Shame.
Hey, Bill.
Your own shame washed over you, Jimmy.
I just realized you called me. I realized I forgot to call you back, so I'm sorry.
You're a fancy guy, Jimmy.
No, I'm not saying I should have. I'm just saying I'm sorry I didn't.
I just figured your people hadn't gotten in contact with you yet.
Yeah, I when I have messages, I'll just tell somebody, like, have somebody call Bill and tell him I'm, you know.
Busy.
Yeah. Hey, Bill, you're into those late-night products. Have you seen the Snuggies yet?
The Snuggies? No.
You're into ShamWow and you haven't seen the Snuggie?
That's late-night TV,
that
my
like
friend.
It's an adult blanket for a pedophile.
It's blankets with sleeves.
It's a blanket with sleeves. It makes you look like a cult member. It's the most horrific thing. You got to look it up online.
It's a fucking robe that you put on backwards.
Yeah.
It's pretty much.
Does it have a hood?
No.
It should
just
have
a blanket
hood
with fucking sleeves. It's the most ridiculous thing.
It's horrible.
It was big for Christmas.
The latest thing I bought, that P90X thing. Have you seen that?
No.
What the fuck is that?
What is that?
What are you, the fighter plane?
Guys like us, guys who are right around 40, who have sort of stayed in shape. It's your last ditch attempt to get shredded.
Oh, no.
And it's actually, this one is actually really good. I highly recommend it, but you have to do the diet.
Is it a machine or a supplement?
Yeah, what is it?
It's basically, it's 12, like, hour-long DVDs.
Uh-oh.
And you remember that muscle confusion thing that I was making fun of, saying everybody in their 40s is going to need a hip replacement in 10 years?
That's what it is?
Well, some days it's regular, like, push-ups and weightlifting, and then other days it's stuff like I never heard of, like, plyometrics. And they got you jumping around like you're going to play cornerback in the Super Bowl. And definitely makes you drop some weight, but your hips start talking to you after a while.
Not made for the hips.
No.
Oh, God.
It should have ended this 2 minutes ago.
I should have ended after the rat story. I don't know why you guys haven't hung up on me.
That story was fantastic.
Yeah. All right, Bill. Thank you.
All right, guys.
See you soon, man.
Thank you for putting up with that last 2 minutes.
No, it's all good. And thank you for Joe DeRosa. He did our show a couple times. He did pretty well for us.
Oh, yeah. He called me up. He was all excited about it.
Yeah, I know he's a good guy. He's obviously one of your boys, so we appreciate it. All right, Bill. See you soon, will you?
All right, guys. Take it easy.
Bill Burr, everyone. Where's intern David? Executive intern David has been working the crowd.
Where is intern David?
And Sam is his handler. This is like a wrestling thing. Sam, come on in with your...
Yeah. Sam's got to kind of leech himself onto whoever is
hot,
popular for this for the minute.
Yeah.
No. You're like a...
That was classic. The fucking bottom of his microphone,
batteries
with the batteries and the transmitter, just fell off of his mic.
Whose mic?
Sam's. It just fucking fell off onto the floor.
Totally disabling the microphone, by the way.
I've been on
merciful
the David bandwagon since day one. There's no leech.
Have you?
Here. Yes.
Yeah, I do like David.
Day one.
David's good.
All right. So what do we got, Sam?
Well,
any observations as he was working the crowd?
Yeah, he got to meet some really interesting people and asked a lot of line of questioning. His main question when he couldn't get to like a really interesting story was, what did you do yesterday?
Ah, that's good, because people did something yesterday if they're here and alive today.
Or one of his other tricks would be, how did you get here? And they'd usually say, by train. And then he'd say, what happened on the train ride?
Ah, see, you're good. You get a scenario.
Yeah.
And then if it doesn't work, like something's not funny, it leaves you an out to get another story out of the same kind of question.
Too bad you're not interviewing Long Island Railroad people from 15 years ago. Yeah. It'd be a hell of a funny show. Oh, black Jamaican shot me and my friend in the face. Oh, and then what happened?
What do you think happened? You're right. All right, David, you worked the crowd for about a half hour. Well, 20 minutes, whatever. What did you find out? Anything good for the show?
We got a couple of things. Honestly, the crowd was very non-talkative, to be quite honest.
What do you mean?
Wow, okay, the crowd sucks, is what David's saying.
That is kind of true.
Oof.
David, why does the crowd suck, David?
I was asking all these questions, like, what do you do for a living? Like, we have an interesting story at your job. What did you do yesterday about the train ride over? And they were saying, no, I don't have anything story, nothing interesting. I have nothing funny to share with ONA, no.
So you're saying they were lackluster?
They were. We got a couple of. We do have a couple of. I'm not saying we have nothing, but it's
a couple of zingers out there, huh?
Dave did say that they were especially boring people.
Really?
Yes.
Yeah.
But we do have a couple of things we can share.
All right. What did you find out?
Who would you like to bring in, David?
It's three sheets of paper there.
Well, David, you want to be on air, so this is a good exercise for you.
Yeah.
So, David, you're saying are you saying they're lackluster?
Say it into the mic.
They were lackluster, yes.
Okay. Don't talk to Sam privately. Say whatever you were going to say to Sam into the mic.
Yeah.
With a fist in between the mic and hopefully moving toward your face at great velocity.
Or how about just 10 E-Rock cocks? Jesus, almost six? Oh, you know. Eight?
Oh, yeah, we couldn't talk about his weenie. Cock over there.
He doesn't have a cock, he's got a weenie.
You know what Eric has? A pud.
But he must have one giant ball, though.
I think it was both balls.
Both balls, it makes one
that was ball
huge
sack.
Ball. What did you think, David? You saw what
I took a closer look, like when he was standing by me, and it was nut sack, and then this little pud coming off of it. And that kind of gave him a little more.
I have to agree with you, Opie. I only noticed one ball.
I think he probably got two.
I know he has two, but it just looked like one big clump.
Well, they come in one sack, you know.
I know.
Yeah. Did you notice his cock bulge?
I did notice that, yes. I noticed that, yes.
Was it delicious to you?
No.
It's hard not to notice, though, right? It's a big fat pouch of meat.
Yes, so you couldn't not see it. If you're looking at him, it's kind of hard not to notice. It was just, like, staring me in the face.
Right in the face?
Oh, really? It was, like, looking right at me. It was bulging out, yeah.
Wow.
What about the cock part? Was it big, you think?
It was pretty big, yeah. I don't know what it was. Maybe it was the fluff or something got him really super excited.
Fluffer? What?
The fluff?
The fluff. Something got him super excited.
Yeah, I got it.
We heard. You we said it same fucking inflection, same everything. You're amazing.
Where is E-Rock real quick? Eric? Eric is not... Yes, he is. Eric has the stuff out of
his
hair.
That mic works over there, too.
Yeah.
E-Rock, how did you get the stuff out of your hair? Because it's like you look normal now. You look the same.
Very hot water continuously dumped all over my head.
How hot?
Very hot. Like steaming hot.
Hmm.
Oh, you said another word for it before.
Piping?
Scalding?
Ah.
All right.
Oh. What kind?
You heard me.
No, I didn't say it.
You heard me. Yes, of course he did. That's why we want to hear it again.
I think it's I never heard of. I'm so sorry that the water reprimanded you.
Yes. Did your parents scold you a lot in your childhood?
No.
No?
No.
Scalding hot water on your head?
Yes.
David says you got a nice piece. Right,
yeah, he was complimenting your
why don't
your
you
balls.
Tell, why don't you tell Iraq? He's
not
in
your
studio.
Not your cock because it's a pud. We've decided, not a pud. I've heard that. I've not heard pud.
I love
used
the word
for
pud.
Dick in years.
Yeah, you're fucking gonna go home and pound your pud.
Pud.
Do you have just a giant like ball bag?
I don't know.
We want to know about your genitals.
Yeah.
Because David was commenting under his breath about the cock.
Well,
the
David,
bulge.
Why don't you tell Iraq? He's here now. What were you saying about his ball bag and his cock and his pud?
I was saying that he got super excited and looked pretty big. He's super excited.
Not used to it from his people.
Hmm?
Ooh.
Wow.
That wasn't very nice.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah, wasn't very good either.
Yeah. What'd you say, Tank?
You heard it.
Tank has a big bulge.
Yeah.
So just that's what I'm saying, that he had a big bulge, and he looked like he had like a huge nutsack, but it was like combined, it's like one big, huge nutsack.
Like just looked like one ball.
One ball, yeah, like combined, yeah.
Yeah.
Basically, like, it's like an idiot factory.
Yes. Sorry, Rob.
Yes.
All right, David, so what do we got from the audience? I see you wrote some notes.
Yeah, we wrote some notes.
He's shuffling through.
We got a couple of things. I mean, as we discussed, they were a pretty boring crowd. They were lackluster. I know, but they weren't given any good stories. They weren't.
Actually, a couple of them started picking fights with making fun of David.
Yeah. Of course.
Yes, but if we get to Anthony, not you, Anthony, there's one of the guys in the crowd was Anthony.
Believe it or not.
Wow.
One of the guys in the crowd, his name was Anthony.
You rarely hear that.
That is an odd coincidence.
Yes, one of the guys in the crowd was Anthony.
You act like it's the opiate.
Oh, no.
Danny found a great picture of a pud. Giant ball sack. Yeah. With little pud.
Yeah. Eric's cockhead is probably so spongy that even when he has a full heart on, it just collapses into the dick when you touch it.
Now, get back to the wonder of more than one Anthony.
Yeah, which is crazy.
Yeah, you act like his name is Sven Kumia.
So there's a guy in the crowd named Anthony.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
that's one of them, Anthony from Toronto.
Oh, Canada.
So. Yes.
And
he works with the family business making pasta.
What kind of pasta?
Canadian pasta. He makes Canadian pasta.
Genco olive oil.
And you might think, pasta Italian. No, he makes Canadian pasta.
What is that all about? That's crazy.
Pasta that needs stronger pasta to defend it from invading pasta.
I'm still trying to figure out what the hell Canadian pasta is. Maybe we should ask him.
All right, you want to bring him in? I mean,
let's roll it up and smoke it and get really stoned from it.
All right. Yeah, probably, right?
And observe when he comes in. Observe him.
Oh, let's observe.
Why?
Observe how he's coming in.
Why?
He's walking in.
Why are you making fun of the fact that he has a cane?
Because that's part of the information. That's part of the story that I gathered from him. There's
a horrible pasta factory accident?
No.
Yes.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
What happened, sir? Just slip on some angel hair.
No, I twisted my knee playing soccer.
All right, as long as you didn't trip over a box of bow ties.
Yes.
No. And okay. You want to know what happened today?
What happened?
Today he tried to sneak into K-Rock. Mm-hmm. And while he was trying to sneak into K-Rock, he was trying to get into the elevator, and the security guard chased him. But he couldn't run away fast because he had a cane, he had twisted his knee. So a
Holy
security
shit.
Guard was chasing after someone with a twisted knee. A disabled
that's
person.
Crazy.
The security guard was chasing after a disabled person, is what I found out from
wow,
him.
Wow, that's insanity.
Jesus, how do you get 13 episodes around that? We got a show.
What's going on over there?
That's crazy.
Oh.
Why was he trying to sneak into K-Rock there?
Yeah, what's there to see there?
I think he's a big fan of you guys.
You
he
think?
Wants to see you, yeah.
Hold on, let me ask. What was your first clue?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, Jesus.
He's a guy and he's fat.
Oh, shit.
Oh, he's right there.
I love you, Jimmy.
I love you,
he's right there, though. You know,
so listen, no, I don't want to make fun of Cuff Pants. So you're from Canada. In the family pasta making business.
Yeah.
Now, what happened to K-Rock?
Well, we didn't know exactly what we had to do to get in.
So we just walked in the door, started walking towards the elevator, and this guy come up, excuse me, sir, you sign in. I go, oh, since when? And he goes, what's your name? I look on the list for you. And he looked at my name, he found an Anthony, but not with my last name, so he goes, no, you gotta go. He just kicked us out.
You gotta go.
Me and my brother.
So he kicked us out.
Yeah.
You and your brother.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
That,
boring.
That Thank story.
You. The point of the story. The point of the story is that the security guard was chasing after a disabled person.
Right. Oh, I think I heard you say that.
I'm sure he was chasing me.
Proving Danny's point, by the way. I'm with you, Danny. Over and over again.
The Canadian pasta.
How many times will he do it on?
But what do you mean? He's saying that, yeah, it wasn't much of a story. What are you saying the story was?
That's a story. That's a story to know about.
Yeah, but what? David, so he chased a guy?
Yes.
All right.
Who was chasing him, though?
The security guard.
Oh, but he's fucking disabled.
Yes, that's why it's an interesting story.
All right.
Interesting story.
It's also interesting because he has Canadian pasta.
Well, let's ask him about that, David. Go ahead.
Can you explain to us what Canadian pasta is and how it differs from Italian pasta?
It's not Canadian pasta. It's made in Canada. That's it.
Therefore, it's Canadian, right?
No.
No,
that's not how
no it's
works.
The same, you know, no. product. Before we go any further, this is information that this gentleman gave David while they were talking out there. David said, oh, Canadian pasta. The guy says, no, it's Italian pasta. We just make it there. And David said, Canadian pasta.
Right, because he didn't hear anything past that.
No,
I heard it. I just chose to go with Canadian
pasta. To ignore it.
So what do you call Chinese food that's made in America?
American Chinese food.
Whoa. American Chinese food?
Yes.
So Canadian pasta.
God, I wish.
Thank you. All
American
right.
Chinese
is this
food.
All we got on this guy? You
That's all we got on this guy, yes.
That was the go-to one that you chose first, yeah. Like your big opener.
Yeah, if that was your, if I'm your big opener, then you have no future in this.
All right, thank you, sir.
Sir, yes, thank you.
We had
all our Canadian friends out there. We got many fans from Canadian.
Good luck with the pasta.
Yes.
All right, David, what do we got next?
There is another interesting. We have
another interesting. Can we get to the first interesting?
Yeah,
right.
Yes, you can either say an interesting or we have boring number two.
We've got another interesting person though. There's a husband and wife here from Pennsylvania. We have Karen from Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm. Alrighty.
She's interesting.
Why is she?
Mm-hmm. She's mm-hmm. a nurse.
Yeah.
Oh. And she's also
a woman wears short sleeves that are too short for her, so she looks like a psychopath.
No, she's interesting because she has an interesting. No. What she does is when she's a nurse in surgery.
Well, David, she's a type of nurse. What type of nurse is she?
I don't know. I can pronounce. Was it anesthesia something? Not an anesthesiologist. What is the type of nurse you are?
I'm a nurse anesthetist.
A nurse anesthetist.
Anesthetist.
Yes.
What's that?
I have no idea what the hell a nurse anesthetist is. No. Maybe she can explain. Do you care to explain, Karen?
I give anesthesia to patients while they're having surgery.
But what's the difference between that and an anesthesiologist?
They make more money than I do.
Are you not at that level yet?
No. They actually supervise three of us. So they'll overlook us. They'll look at the paper, the computer. They'll see the patients. We actually do their anesthesia, take care of them.
That's crazy. I don't want you doing my anesthesia. I want the main guy doing it.
Yeah.
But we do it better than the main guy.
That's how they do it all the time now. They just delegate. She's like the executive intern.
So then why can't you be the main guy if you're actually doing it?
Because I'm a nurse and not a doctor.
Anesthesiologist is a doctor?
Yes.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Yeah. And they make a shitload of money.
Yes, they do.
I think Malcolm Marsh is an anesthesiologist.
But he's watching you nurses and saying, all right, yeah, give him this, give him that.
No, we actually just give what we think.
Shit.
If we have problems, we'll call them. They're not there with us.
No?
No.
You give what you think?
Yeah.
What kind of surgeries?
Wow.
Anything. I do pretty much anything but labor and delivery or open heart.
Holy shit.
You get to take a little home with you?
Yeah.
No, I'd get in big trouble. I don't want to have to pee in front of people and pee in a cup.
Yeah.
Do they make you pee a lot?
No. They would if they suspected you, though.
Right.
These are the questions David asked, right? Same
ones. Oh, yeah.
Sorry. What am I doing?
Yeah.
David,
I know. What are you doing asking silly, stupid questions of this woman when David's already pre-interviewed?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, David. Dad.
So, I kind of inquired about her, about her and what she, if she had any interesting stories to tell about one particular surgery she was performing. She did have an interesting particular surgery.
Oh, she did.
I think she would like to share when she was working at giving anesthesia to one patient getting a breast reduction.
Yeah.
getting a breast reduction.
So ah, breast reduction.
Breast reduction,
like Punky Brewster.
All right, so
we got one of those.
He's like Carson, like doing breast reduction. You need some. You need some index cards to tap on the desk. And so breast reduction.
Yeah, he's tapping.
Correct.
Breast reduction.
So she's had breast reductions. Who cares?
No, she hasn't. She was She was performing a surgery.
Ask
she was
her
in
how
the surgery.
Big her boobs are, there, David.
She was in the surgery. She has an interesting story to tell about it.
But what? Ask her about her.
Well,
breasts
maybe
first.
You should let her tell it.
No, ask her about her boobs first.
The twitch.
I don't think we want to know about that. We want to know about the story.
I don't want to talk about my boobs.
We want to know about her story.
She wants to talk about her boobs, so
no,
ask her about
I
her
don't.
Boobs.
Sam
no,
is tapping
doesn't.
Him, and yeah, he twitches like crazy. It's so funny.
David, how...
and Jimmy leaned over, and he tenses up.
I just had you. I wanted to ask you. What was she? She was doing a breast reduction surgery, and
no,
she
wasn't doing this. Yeah, she was doing the anesthesia during the surgery.
Yeah, because she's the anesthesia nurse.
Anesthesia, whatever it is. Yeah.
Anesthetist.
Yes. I think we should let her tell the story.
Okay.
Oh,
she knows how to tell. She knows how to tell the story. It's pretty funny.
When David gets tapped,
pretty funny.
He has an Elvis lip, real quick.
Yes.
He's like a fainting goat, but he's not a goat, and he stands there.
All right. You don't like to be touched, do you, David?
No, but I think we should let her tell the story.
All right. All right. Go ahead.
I was giving anesthesia for a breast reduction surgery, which I know.
Ooh, how big a pair of tits were they?
They were pretty darn big.
Was she a big girl?
Yeah, but she also had neck pain, shoulder pain when they're too big, that, you know, that happens. And I know that's hard to fathom, but it does. And the way they do it is, if they're really big, they cut off the nipple and the areola, and they put it aside, and then they shape the breast the right way, and they put the nipple back so it's nice and perky and where it should be.
What, do they roll her like a tube of toothpaste and squeeze out the extra titty?
I don't think that would work. So unfortunately, one of the nipples got dropped on the floor.
Oh, no.
Really? Yes.
Wait, did a dog run in and eat it? A small schnauzer. They had to rifle through dog shit to get the nipple back and hope that she didn't notice that it was brown with a fucking kibble on it.
Is the nipple completely removed from any blood flow and everything?
Yes, it's just the layer, the brown areola and the nipple, and it's just
brown.
It's cut off, just a really thin layer of it, and they put it aside, and then they reshape the breast, and they cut
I would assume it would have to be reattached pretty quickly.
No, they just put it in some saline solution, keep it nice and moist.
Okay, right.
Yeah, they finish
saline.
Up, sew it back
that's
on.
Scary.
That's how did it get magic solution?
Yeah, saline. You're right. Saline. You put
drop it on the floor.
Yeah.
How did it get knocked on the floor? Was somebody doing some kind of an impression of a movie? And
bit.
I think the container it was in got bumped off accidentally.
Using
somebody.
Two of them as castanets.
The container got knocked. Because it probably hit the floor and then the nipple just kind of flew out. Think, and did it roll?
I didn't see
like
it.
Like a suckable marble?
But it was one of those oh shit moments in surgery where everybody goes, what?
Yeah, so put the fucking thing in alcohol and throw it back on.
Well, they actually put it in antibiotic solution. Rinsed it off, and then they eventually sewed it back on.
Oh. That's the whole thing?
That's it.
Was there a dust bunny on it?
I didn't look.
Came up with a search or a penny on it?
Oh, all dirty. Did it, when it finally stopped rolling, did it go... When you drop a quarter.
Lucky you didn't have a cat in that room. Kind of like the dog joke, but I switched species.
Yes.
So was everything all right, or did Eric get an infection?
God damn, Danny.
Actually, it was a woman, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was an. It
oh,
was a
literal gem.
That's a funny line. Is that it, David?
That's it with her. That was a funny
wow.
Story.
That is a funny
that was, and he gonna reiterate how funny it was.
I want to thank the healthy lady Di for telling her story today.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Oh.
I said healthy lady Di, though. I changed it up. I could have just said lady Di.
Your sleeves are a little short.
I know I'm tall. When it's when you're tall, it's...
But, see, I wouldn't even be able to tell if that was like supposed to be worn like that.
It actually is.
In other words, I'm calling Jimmy a faggot.
Hey, no. But I'm saying sleeves being really short make a person look crazy.
I'm a little crazy.
You look like a crazy person.
I'm a little crazy, yeah.
Short. I never realized that, but do they?
Somebody
loves to do that. I just want to roll
mentally
mine up,
ill
not
people,
walk around.
Mentally ill people never have clothes that fit. Because they're so fucking nuts, nobody wants to take away their clothes. They just get wear it until it dies. And they grow up, and they have short sleeves, and they strangle small animals.
Alrighty.
And then no, I just have to admit, I was a little hungover, and I just sort of pulled something on so we could get here.
So who's your husband out here? Which one is the husband?
What does he do for a living? Couldn't hear you. Why would
he's a network engineer.
Oh, network engineer.
Why would it work?
Mr. Computer, why would it work?
Why would it?
I'm a network engineer.
Computer guy, huh?
Yep.
Yeah.
Nice.
Network engineer. For what? Like freelance? What do you do?
No, I work for Verizon.
Oh.
Wow. What do you do
for Jimmy likes that, right?
Thanks to the good... Hey, are you friends with the guy who gets the best service ever?
No. No.
Is he a big shot around Verizon? The guy, does he walk in his Verizon uniform and everybody wants to brain him with a hammer, but they have to be nice to see the face on the fucking posters?
We've never met him.
Oh, really?
I know. I was just kidding.
Really?
You really work there. You're one of the guys that are standing behind everybody with your phones, right?
I'm part of the network.
Wow, great.
That's pretty neat. All right.
Thanks.
You have Verizon service? Hey, what is it that makes Verizon? Because AT&T sucks a fucking pile of dicks, and I've heard mixed reviews on Sprint. What does Verizon use that's different than AT&T?
Magic,
Sprint?
Jimmy.
Sprint. It is magic. I thought so.
Yes.
Do they have little goblins?
No, I think Verizon just has more cell towers across the country and has better coverage than AT&T.
But isn't there something else? My ex-brother-in-law used to work for them. He said there's something like a chip that they don't share with the other phones, that the other phones have to share with each other.
I'm not too sure because that's like Verizon Wireless. I actually work for Verizon Business.
Oh. So. Hey, okay. And mind your own, Jim.
That's right. Why? Does he work for Verizon's beeswax?
Yeah. What phone he has. Ask him what his cell phone is, Jimmy.
What's that?
Oh. Ask him what kind of cell phone he has.
All right. How big's your cock?
It's huge.
I ask what I want to
know,
ask.
I know it's an iPod.
It is. Or an iPhone.
An iPhone?
Of course it is.
Well, yeah. How's your reception where you live? In Pennsylvania, I actually have good iPhone reception.
It's fine. I haven't had any problems with it.
Okay, that's the thing. Put a few apps on there. By the way, who's the fucking Francis from Stripes mental patient in the back?
Oh, my God.
Psychotic fuck.
Me?
Actually, David. He looks like, what's his name from Lost?
Oh, my God, he does.
Yeah.
Let's hope he suffers the same thing. Well, yeah. You look kind of crazy, man.
No. I don't know.
I don't know. What do you want?
Blowjobs.
Okay.
Apparently, he's a genie. All right, David, are we done with the...
All right.
The story here.
Do you want to know more stories from her? Like, you want to keep talking to her?
Does she have anything else?
No, okay. You're the one that
I'd like to know more. Like, have you been a part of any, like, interesting or different types of surgeries or weird surgeries?
She's told you that. The nipple fucking thing.
Yeah, well, that's a normal surgery. That's just what
an accident
that
a nipple falling
happened.
On the floor.
What do you think? Sewing a different head on someone's fucking body? What do you think she's done?
I want to know.
It's not going to get better than that. You got to cut
your
losses.
That's as good as it is.
Yes.
That's the story. The nipple falling on the floor. Okay. It's hysterical. It's a scream.
Anybody else from the crowd, David?
We got a couple other people.
What was wrong with most of them, David?
What?
Well, how come there weren't too many good answers?
They were just lackluster, and they were saying, like, I don't have any interesting stories to tell, or I don't have anything.
But is it that they were all lackluster, or they didn't want to talk to you?
I think it was they were pretty much all lackluster, yeah. I'm not trying to be rude. I don't want to be.
No, you're being honest.
I don't want to be rude, but they
want to be called lackluster.
I know they don't want to be, but...
They were.
That's what they were, yeah.
They were basically, it was basically a collection of duds.
But I do have another guy that we talked to for a bit.
All right, let's see. What do you
we
got?
We have Kevin.
Sam.
What's Kevin all about?
Kevin is all about that he's from, happens to be from Mamaroneck, which is the same place as where Sam is from.
Oh, really?
Yes. Oh!
So that's from the
I
same
ditched
town.
A car there once.
They're from the same town. Yeah. They're from the same town. They didn't know each other.
Ah.
And so, Kevin told Sam about a place in Mamaroneck, like a deli that Sam never even heard of. He doesn't even know that Sam doesn't. He just learned that Sam doesn't know half the restaurants in his own town or places where he lives.
What a dumb cunt!
And you thought this would be worth talking about on the radio?
Yes.
You found a guy that's from Sam's town.
This is
almost not even worth thinking alone, much less talking about the two countries. But let's bring in the Mamaroneck restaurant, fucking maybe.
Yeah.
Well, there's more to this.
Shit.
There's more to it.
At the end of talking to Kevin, he quietly leaned into me and said, "This is the best guy we've talked to."
Oh, so you saved it for last.
Why is he the best guy we talked to?
Because this guy is a dispatcher for a limousine company.
Oh my God!
Dispatcher for a limousine company.
What does he have? Does he have an interesting story besides selling Judd Hirsch's sweater for taxi?
Holy shit! Jesus!
Right there.
Well, it's not so much an interesting story. It's just we try to inquire some questions about him to see if we can get him to do certain things.
Oh, okay. Let's, we'll watch this. Go ahead, Dave.
We try to inquire, since he lives in the same town as Sam, we try to inquire if he can get his limousine service to pick up Sam at his house every day and bring him to work.
God damn, that's crazy.
Wait. You mean you wanted to get Sam a ride in a limo?
Yeah,
if
he lives in the same town as Sam and he's a limo dispatcher, he can get his limousine company to pick up Sam and drive him here for free. I mean, that's the least he could do for Sam.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
All right, sir.
What?
Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Sure. What, now, David's painting this crazy... I mean, this is the stuff movies are made of. You know? You and Sam live in the town. All of a sudden, you drive Sam. Sam gets here with the same thing we always... It's crazy. How do you feel about David's...
Oh, he's a fantastic interviewer.
Yeah, he is good, isn't he?
Yes, he's full of insightful questions.
David, Ooh. Get something out of him.
Yeah, come on, David. Guy.
You picked him from the audience.
You picked him.
It's a blitter riff.
Oh, David, real fast. What did you have to say for me? For my,
he wanted to say that he wanted to give a big ups to his cousin Jerome. I just wanted to mention that.
Big ups are always good for the show. Yeah. We love big ups.
I'm a big fan of the big ups.
Yep.
So you thought bringing someone in for a big ups was good?
Well, as I said before, most of the people aren't that good that we talk to, so this is pretty good.
Oh, they're just yelling, fuck you out there.
So, Kevin, what did you think about this? Would you consider asking your limousine company to try to give Sam free rides?
You're going with the bit, huh?
Yeah, I could see if we could arrange something like that, obviously, for some plugola.
Yeah, plugola. Oh, yeah. That's what we want to announce on the air you would mention it.
Well, I'll exchange favors for plugs.
For free stuff, right. Yeah, to get free stuff, you would plug... His limo company.
Oh, yes. We're not allowed to do that?
I guess not.
Oh, well, then someone's going to have a few problems about those products I was promised. I'm kidding. Not only did I stop the flow of the show, but I bombed so badly.
Yeah, yeah.
My apologies to the audience here and abroad.
That was... We didn't even initially know you bombed because you have to know there's a joke maybe coming.
I know. It was basically what I did was I just, you were all standing here. It's like everyone was at a wake and I just rolled a bowling ball in front of the coffin. And you all went, what was that?
That's funnier.
Yeah, I know it is. He was laying there in a bowling ball roll. See that? You pull yourself out with the familiar.
Of course.
Oh, yeah.
The familiar. It works. Ah, David. Yeah, the line of questioning. Forget about the limo ride and stuff. Just go with something else. Riff okay, with
so
the guy.
Get some out of him.
So what's this deli that you introduced Sam to that's in the same town as you both live in?
Mamaroneck.
Yeah. Mamaroneck.
Yeah, the name of the deli is Anthony's Deli.
Another ant something with Anthony.
Holy shit.
Anthony
with a deli? That's insanity.
A Time Life commercial.
Yeah.
The third Anthony we've had today. Wow.
Oh, David.
Wow. Holy shit.
Yeah, how about that?
Unbelievable.
How about that?
What else,
your
David, you're
lack of charisma
Ask
and
him
insight.
His favorite sandwich from the deli, maybe.
What do you like about this deli? What's so good about it? What's so good about this deli?
Oh, man. They just... give you a pretty good deli.
What kind of food?
Hold on, you go to the deli and they give you a pretty good deli?
They give you a pretty good selection of whatever you want.
What an odd store. What would you like? I'll take one of everything and
the deli on the spot over here.
The building, right? Deli.
What's your favorite food to eat at this deli?
You're right. Chicken cutlets, the meatballs, anything.
Would you consider taking meeting up with Sam and taking Sam and introducing him to this deli?
Yeah, we could have a play date.
A play date? Oh. Yeah,
we could do something like that.
Sam, how do you feel about this? Would you have a play date with Kevin?
Well,
I think Kevin just show you around the town. I mean, you live in Mamaroneck and you don't have a clue what goes on there.
Right? Again, he says
maybe
it.
Maybe Kevin should take you around the town, show you around, introduce you to the sights and sounds of Mamaroneck.
Don't the two of us live far away?
No, you both live in Mamaroneck.
Whoa!
Would you like Kevin to take you on a tour of Mamaroneck?
No, thank you.
No!
He's a retarded child.
How many times are you going to say it?
You don't think he would be a good tour guide?
What town does he even live in?
What? for the town of Amerenek. You're insulting this guy. What if he wanted to show you around town?
Not so much.
Hang out.
Well, what's he going to show me?
Why don't you ask him?
Why don't you ask him?
If you were taking Sam on a tour of Amerenek, what sites would you show him? Where would you show him around?
Danny just threw something in his head.
I can listen to this all day. I don't
know. Not much to see, actually.
Nothing?
Nothing.
What goes on in Amerenek every day? What do you guys do for fun?
Nothing.
Where do you hang out?
People leave there to go to work.
Are there any hot spots you can show? You should show Sam. He's obviously unfamiliar.
I just don't know the deli.
You don't know the deli? Don't know the limousine service?
Don't know this guy? Don't know Anthony?
Yeah, like that's the center of fucking of all the culture.
Yes.
In Amerenek.
Yeah, maybe I think these two should hang out just after. Oh.
Sorry. We're just looking at TV. We didn't mean to distract you. Do we have one more guy outside?
Okay, thank you very much,
you
Kevin.
Bye,
he doesn't even look at him. He just goes, thank you very much. You just fucking dismiss these people.
We got time for one more, I think, David.
Bye. One more.
One more.
Okay.
Pick the best one, then.
What's the matter? You're not feeling...
Okay, we got another person. We got Vern from Philly.
Oh, God, this has got to be good.
Vern from Philly. What's Vern all
about? Vern from Philly is working his way in right now up to the microphone.
Oh, this is... I mean, that was one of my favorite shows, Vern and Early.
This is going great.
Wow.
Did you see that shirt?
All right, Dave, what do we got on Vern from Philly?
Honestly, this guy's not very interesting. The point why we brought him up is because we were arguing with each other, so I thought it would be interesting to share what happened.
What happened? No chemistry? Dave? You didn't
hit
it off?
I started talking to him, inquiring about him. And we were like, what do you do for a living? Have anything interesting stories? No, no, no. And we're talking. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, he just says, what's wrong with the shirt? What's with the shirt you're wearing? It looks like it's from 1994.
Oh!
Oh,
snap. Out of nowhere.
Out of nowhere.
We were just having a nice friendly conversation. Out of nowhere. He goes over and insults my shirt.
So what do you want to say to him? Look him in the eye.
And then I proceeded to insult his shirt back.
Oh, no.
What'd
you say about his shirt?
He got me back. Why?
What did you say about his shirt?
He said to me,
what's wrong with the back of his shirt?
He said to me, what's with your shirt? Is it from 19? Looks like your shirt's from 1994. I wore your shirt in 1994. And I proceeded to say to him, oh, you think your shirt's any better?
No!
Oh, wow.
No, no! That's
crazy. Holy shit. The barbs that were traded out there.
Yeah, definitely.
How did we not see a fight start?
I don't know what came about. I just asked him, what do you do for a living? What's going on in your life? Any interesting stories? Oh, your shirt sucks.
No!
Damn.
Oh.
Damn. Yeah.
So what'd you do?
I insulted his shirt, then I proceeded to insult his shoes also.
No!
His shoes?
No!
What's wrong with his shoes, David? What'd you say about his shoes?
Yeah.
I said, where'd you get those shoes? You get them at Payless?
Oh!
God damn. That's fucking ruthless now, David.
Sneakers.
David, there's a line that you don't understand when to cross it. You don't fucking insult somebody to that extent until they throw something bad at you. Payless. Oh, my God,
but
David.
It's out of nowhere. We're just having a nice conversation. He insults my shirt out of nowhere. So
wow, you're like dropping A-bombs on the motherfucker.
I thought we should bring this guy in. And
so why don't you try to get along with him? Why don't you do a little...
I think we should inquire about why he was so upset with my shirt and why he...
No, why don't you just try to get along?
Should we inquire?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think this guy likes me very much.
He's from Philly. His name's Vern. Find out more about Vern. Go ahead, David. Try again.
I don't know if I can do it. There's something about me that he doesn't...
I like you, David.
Yeah, what's wrong
with you?
If you don't like me, why did you insult my shirt?
Exactly.
I just asked where you got the shirt.
Did you mention
that? No, that's not true. That is not true. He said, what's with that shirt? I wore that shirt in 1994.
Maybe he did. It does kind of almost look like a Kurt Cobain-ish kind of grunge type shirt.
Exactly, without the brains to blow out.
Yeah.
David, do you think that he insulted your shirt because you commented that he has a... oh boy, I can't remember the movie. Oh boy. I'm tired, man.
I'm scared.
I know what I was going to say. Go ahead. Why did he insult you?
I don't know why he insulted me. That's what we're trying to find out right now.
Okay.
Wow, that's what we're trying to find out.
He said he likes you.
He said he likes you?
If he likes me, why would he insult me?
Did you ask if you could also try on Liam Neeson's wig from Taken?
No, I didn't. No, I didn't. I haven't seen that movie yet, so I don't know.
You didn't need it to hear that joke, Bob.
Oof.
Thanks, Jimmy.
Sorry, so you're all right.
Taken. The humor from the room.
I really have.
Was taken.
I'm like the ShamWow with fucking humor. The ShamBoo. The ShamDud. Yuck. All right.
So anyways, what do you do again? I didn't really remember anything about you because you insulted me. But if we try to get along, what do you do in Philly?
I'm an engineer.
Oh, that's right. What kind of engineer are you?
Mechanical.
What company do you work for? What do you do?
I don't want to say my company.
Okay, so don't say that, but what do you do for, like, elaborate?
We design furnaces for steel mills.
Okay, there you go.
Wow, you need a head on your shoulders for that there, David. Certainly.
Yes, sir, yeah. So
you make a mistake, and then that fucking big thing pours out that molten metal all over the floor instead of where it's supposed to go.
It's probably a big time right now for you guys, especially because it's the winter, and a lot of furnaces are being used in the winter time, right?
No, it's furnace. Oh, my God. Oh, my God, he didn't just say that.
What's the guy do? I didn't hear it.
No?
No.
He makes, you know, furnaces for the steel
industry. Well, I know for the steel mills. I know that, but...
Yeah.
For steel, I understand that part, but
you understand that? So now with the cold weather, people need furnaces.
No, the steel mill needs this furnace in the winter.
Why?
It's cold.
Do you understand
they're not using it
for warmth in the place? They're using it to melt fucking steel?
Right.
Yeah, I understand that.
To make you didn't.
I understand that.
No, you didn't. Don't say you did. You didn't understand it.
You understood that, right?
Yeah.
No, you didn't. You said it was to keep warm, but it's to melt steel.
He really did understand.
No, he didn't.
No, he did.
Did you mean that, or you knew what it was, right?
Nah.
He fucks it up every single way.
He falls under questioning.
Got a nice little bit going, and fuck.
He just falls. That's right. No, all right. No, I didn't. I thought it was to keep warm.
Hey, something else came to my attention the other day. He's not a big fan of Obama, right?
No, he's not a fan of Obama whatsoever.
I say that because Obama's on every TV right now. He's doing a little live press conference. He's not a fan?
No, he hates Obama.
Why do you hate Obama, David?
Besides the obvious.
Yeah. I don't know. I didn't like Obama. I didn't like McCain either, honestly. I didn't like
We're not asking about that. We're asking about the president of the United States.
And it doesn't matter about McCain because he's not... Yeah.
Yeah, so why don't you like Obama?
What's your problem with him?
I don't know. He just seems very unbelievable and very phony. Like he always talks about all this change that he's gonna bring, to the world, and he says he's gonna somehow rescue the economy and bring all this money. I don't know where the heck is he gonna get all this money from that he promises everyone. How is he gonna change the world with his change? I'm very confused with this man.
God, Ant's got a playmate.
You might have to start hanging out
with this guy.
There's President George Bush. He didn't do any change. Do you think this guy can do any better? Where's this change going to come from? Where's this money and all this, like, change the world, change everything with the war in Iraq? Oh, a better country, a better everything. I don't know. I don't believe this guy.
You think
he's
full of shit?
I do think so.
The Jews don't like him, right?
I don't know about that.
He's a little too touchy-feely with the Muslims and, the people that
are
against
the Jews. That's another reason why I don't.
The Jews.
That's true, too. And he also, I didn't like about the church that he preached at back in the day.
That he preached at?
Yeah.
Well, he didn't preach there. He just went there.
Church did he preach at?
Well, he was the pastor at his church.
The
pastor, yeah. And he was a part of that church, so that didn't...
Yeah, that doesn't look good for you.
But I think he's a phony.
Yeah?
He's phony. I believe so.
Well, okay. Well,
right. He's just
president.
Trying to help people out. What do you think?
I know he's trying to help people out, but I don't see where all this change is going to come from. Where is he going to come up with all this money to rescue America? Where the heck is he going to come up with it? I don't know.
Good idea. Print more up. Why don't they just print a bunch of money and give it out?
He's going to print it? Where's it going to come from?
From the Treasury. They get paper, some ink. Yeah. You print a bunch of money, and then you mail it out to people. Why can't you do that?
I don't know.
And if you don't like Obama and you don't like McCain, who should have been president?
I didn't vote for president.
No, I understand that, but who would you like in there? Or what type of guy would you like in there in the White House?
I don't know who I want. I just want someone that would be, take more control over everything and have, a set goal and a set plan and know what they're actually doing.
Mm-hmm. That's like what Bush we'd like in an intern, too.
Like, President Bush was so... like, President Bush was no good. He didn't know what he was doing. He was so confused with his weapons of mass destruction and stuff. He was very confused.
Well, they found them, though. They found them.
No, they didn't.
Okay.
They didn't find them. Where did they find them? That was the whole point, that he thought there were weapons of mass destruction and there were nothing. Yeah. He was wrong.
He wasn't wrong. They found them in
where did they find the weapons?
Right.
They did find
him. Yeah, they were over there
somewhere. Maranek? Oh, okay.
Jesus. All right, who do we got next? Anything? Can we finish up with one more of your...
Up or what? It's up to David at this
David?
Point.
He's shuffling through his papers.
Any more good people, to be honest.
No? Sam?
Well, I mean, if you want to talk to the woman that he said was the most boring, we could talk to bring her in.
All right.
Yeah, let's bring...
Come on in.
Yes.
Oh, please.
David said that Dana from Philadelphia was the most boring
Dana,
person he talked to.
Work your way
it
in
seems
here.
Seems to be that there's a lot of people here from Philly today.
Yeah, that's cool. We like Philly.
Yeah.
Yes. A lot of Philly people.
There you go.
Philly's actually being...
All right, it's Dana.
Hi, Dana.
Hi, Dana.
Hi, Dana.
How are you?
Awesome. Cool.
Awesome.
You're in here because David said that you're the most boring person on the planet.
Yes. I'm a little hungover and a little tired.
Yeah, that's all right. She's hungover and tired.
One fist away from the mic, please.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, that's David's rules.
Is that better?
That's David's rules. We don't know.
We live by his rules.
He was taught by professionals, so we don't know shit. Because we've just been doing radio for years and, you know, double that. And that's how long Opie's been doing radio. But, yeah, whatever.
David, you said she's boring.
Yeah.
Exceptionally so.
She's Dana. She's from Philly, though. Pretty much all I got out of her that she's a medical. She's a medical biller.
Uh huh.
Examiner.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And she, I kept asking.
Wow, that was kind of a dismissive. Okay.
Okay, she's not. She's a medical examiner. If you want to be precise.
Yeah.
And I kept on inquiring, like, what did she do? Like, any interesting stories? I'm saying, no, she had nothing to really say.
How did you inquire? That's what I want to know. Question her, not like a fucking interrogation, but as she is somebody you are interviewing for a radio show. Go ahead, just throw some questions at her and try to get something out of her.
Well, I got a couple of, like, a little bit of out of her. Like, I inquired about, like, what she was doing last night.
All right. Why don't you recreate that special moment that happened outside right here in our studios?
Okay. What did you do last night?
Yes, he did. Okay.
Well, I drank excessively and played pool.
All right. No, you're okay.
Yeah, and I appreciate that you bring up drag racing, because my family did that.
Nice. Really?
I used to race, too.
You did?
You raced?
A little junior dragster, a little Briggs and Stratton motor.
You got a little...
Injected alcohol.
Do you also fly planes in the 1920s?
Don Garlic.
No, but the one that flew, it was Vern that was just in here.
Oh, yeah?
How fast did you go?
Oh, those things only go like maybe 65.
Yeah,
impressive
when you're a young kid.
Wow.
My dad,
10-year-old going 65 miles an hour.
Yeah. Who was your dad, Don Garlitz? Big Daddy Don Garlitz?
How fast has your dad?
It's a drag racing joke, Kimmy.
I think he's done about 150. It was nostalgia. Funny
car. Wow. Oh.
Mm-hmm. See, we're getting a lot out of her, David.
See, it's drag racing.
David, they're not going to teach you in the Connecticut School of Broadcasting, but she said she drank a lot and played pool, so now work off that.
There's more than just the pool. She didn't just play pool. She's in a pool league.
All right, work off that. Now work off that.
Wow.
Now develop your interview. Work off that.
Go ahead.
So what type of a league is this?
I mean, I know you didn't.
No, I'm trying to get out of it. Like,
holy shit!
I'm trying to get out of it. Like, what? Like,
oh,
I'm trying to get out of it. Like, what's the format of the league and like the people that are in the league? I want to know about
fucking
that.
Fucking goal.
I want to know about like the people in the league and.
Let it rip.
Okay.
Develop this
pool league.
Go ahead.
So you're in a pool league, I understand. How many people are in this league?
You can have up to eight.
Eight?
Well, eight per team, and then the league
eight.
Is about
most interesting
10 people,
thing ever.
10 different balls.
Oh, eight. I thought there'd be seven or nine.
How competitive is this league? Like, do you play for like money, or do you like play for certain like what goes
you
on?
You play to. To be...
To get drunk.
No. You can go to, like, any big event, and they'll pay you, just like Las Vegas. They'll fly you down there if you're good enough.
Mm.
Your whole team.
Oh, like a regular professional, like, pool?
Sort of, yeah.
Oh, okay. How did you get so good at pool? First of all, are you any good at pool? Like, where do you rank in this league? Like, how good is your team?
I'm a two.
Two, what does that mean? Like, is that good?
Well, I'm just starting off, and for a woman, it's fine.
What's the highest you can go?
Eight.
Okay.
I think.
Who's an eight?
the Black Widow.
That Asian chick, yeah.
Yeah, they're up
What's
there.
What's her name, Black Widow?
Fucking pretty intense when you watch her on ESPN name? 20.
That don't matter, fuck it. Yeah, David, work your interview.
Come on, David.
So who, like, how does the league work? Like, is there a certain, like, amount of people on a team?
You knock
or?
Balls in pockets.
I understand that, but is there, like, certain people
yes,
on a team?
Yes, 8 players total, but only 5 can play per night. And then whoever wins, you know.
Bar league?
Yeah.
Sorry. Just wanted to add that in. If it was some kind of a, you know, you had to go somewhere special.
Hence
or it's
drinking.
Like darts. Yeah, I understand. But believe me, even if it's not in a bar, I'd be drinking.
Here.
So, you think you see yourself like getting more like developing a career out of pool, like becoming like a professional billiards player, or like
no.
He doesn't know how to turn
nothing.
And take the pool thing and then go somewhere else and
just, David, work off what you got and think about what the listeners want.
That's all that I got.
But just because she started with the pool thing doesn't mean you got to make the whole thing about pool.
Right.
Like, all right, you got it. Now she plays pool. She plays in a bar. She drank last night. Like, there's a few areas you could touch on there. She looks like a chick that likes going and having a good time, partying a little bit, you know, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like, fucking do something.
No,
you were just denied. Sam just did something. And he goes, no. No. Sam just suggested something. And he goes, no.
Well, Sam's his handler. What were you suggesting there?
There are questions that he had written that now
write,
he doesn't want to ask
them. I didn't write
them.
Those questions.
David, they're on your index cards. You wrote them.
I don't want to ask those questions.
Ask the question. Just read the card that you wrote.
Oh, God. He tapped him again. He jumps out of his fucking skin.
I don't want to ask that.
It's your handwriting, David. Just read it.
I don't want to ask that.
All right, you might as well ask it, because this interview's
going just
nowhere.
Ask it. It's going nowhere. You're bombing. You got to fucking
bombing.
Pull out the heavy guns.
Yeah, you
ask the question.
Go with the desk
no,
stuff.
We're just like...
Ask the question. You're bombing. You're fucking losing our audience.
Let's go, David.
Ask it.
How many miles of dicks have been in you? That's the question. I was asking. You wonder why... Sam, you wonder why I don't ask that question. I told you I don't want to ask.
Yeah, because it got a really bad reaction. You're right. I'm with David. That should have been asked.
Yeah, you know. You hate. See, when the audience makes that guffaw noise, it's a horrible thing.
Yeah. You're right. Yeah. I'm with you, David.
No comment.
There you go.
And ask her if the road was multicolored.
All right, here's another question for
you. Oh, David. I can't ask that.
David, you just asked the last one. Ask it.
Ask the question. What's
Come
wrong
on.
With you?
You just got a foothold with the crowd. They're with you. Now ask the question. You're going to go back to fucking pool questions?
No.
Come on, for
question.
Fuck's sake. Buck up. Do the show.
We're teaching you. Do the bit, right. I heard that. Very good. Go ahead, David. Ask the question.
Okay. This is the question. If you had to guess the amount of cum that you've ingested in your lifetime, how much would you say you've had?
Right?
That's the question that I'm...
You know,
but Dave,
you got a young lady in here,
yeah,
and now
old,
you fucking insult
cool,
her like that.
It's not my thing. Whatever, you ask the fucking question.
No. You got to have some kind of discretion when you're asking people stuff. There's a young lady in here.
I don't want to ask
and
those
you fucking,
questions.
Whatever, you did. You should have stuck to your fucking guns and not asked it, is what we're saying. We're trying to teach you.
No,
fuck the pool. We're trying to, like, teach you something here. No matter how much someone asks you to do something, you got to use your own common sense. There's a nice young lady, and you asked her that horrible fucking question. It's terrible.
It's being put in my face.
Now, what's that?
All right, so just ask her this one.
One more question.
Wait,
one more question.
It's one more question. One more, and then we can wrap up.
You're bombing. Ask her the fucking question.
Why do you keep throwing the questions?
Don't throw the cards at Danny.
If you want, asking that question.
Do you want to be executive intern?
Yes.
Then right, ask the fucking question.
I'm not asking that question.
I swear to God, you'll be out the fucking door if you don't ask the fucking question. I'm not even kidding you.
You think he's kidding? Look at his face.
I don't fucking jump on people, but I'm jumping on you. You don't ask the question, you're fucking out the door. We'll get another executive intern. Ask the fucking question.
All right.
And wait, don't read the fucking question. Look her in the eye.
And ask the fucking question.
I want this to be believable.
Do it. Do it.
Do it.
On mic, motherfucker. Come on.
I can't do it.
Do it.
I'm just saying, we just went through this. Not
come on. Fucking with the.
Dude, Paul's
look
waiting
at the time.
Paul's waiting in the wings to become executive intern, and we'll make that fucking
he's good,
move
believe
now.
Me.
I wouldn't hesitate to ask that question, David.
I don't fuck around. Am I ever like this? I'm fun guy, and you got me pissed.
Okay.
Come on. Ask the fucking question.
Fine.
Look her in the eye. Don't read it.
Have you ever eaten a pussy or had yours eaten by another woman?
Jesus Christ.
No.
You learned nothing. Why did you ask it? I told you to stick to your fucking guns.
I asked it because you said...
Holy shit. But stick to your guns. You didn't want to reread the question. That's what you do. You don't read it.
And then you were not going to...
Yeah, but I don't fucking... What am I? I'm not going to fire you. You fucking folded.
You just said you were going to.
Stick to your guns. That's the most important thing in this business. You don't fucking kowtow to me. You don't answer a question like that.
He was giving you a lesson.
The fucking lady... I just told you don't ask questions like that.
You told me you were
firing. No matter what.
He was
to get you going.
He was testing.
Oh my god, you are the most confused motherfucker.
You said you're gonna fire me if you didn't.
Yeah, but that was a way to make you ask it when you went against your fucking better judgment.
Yep.
She's a nice young lady and you ask these horrific fucking questions.
What am I supposed to do in that situation? What if you.
It's the Kobayashi Maru, douchebag.
What am I supposed to do? I mean, you're supposed to. What am I supposed to do in that situation? I'm supposed to either ask the question or go or get fired. God.
David, you want to give out your Facebook for the people out there? They're all dying to...
What am I supposed to do in that situation?
Exactly. It's a test of character. There's no right or wrong.
It's either I don't ask the question and be polite and I ask rude questions like that, or I go against your wishes and get fired.
That's the quandary.
Test of character.
Yeah.
Sam. No right or wrong answer.
I won't do it. I don't want to get fired.
Sam?
David was panicking yesterday and leaving messages on my Facebook page because... 100 people had added him after I mentioned yesterday on the air that he had Facebook.
Oh, no.
And he didn't know who any of them were.
So he had to verify each one with you.
Well, then I started getting messages from other people who are fans of the show saying that David messaged them saying, I don't know who you are. Who are you? Why did you add me?
By the way, it's not going to help that they just put his Facebook name on the pad data.
Oh, wow.
Oh, no.
Wow, you're going to get quite a few friend requests, David, and comments.
Yeah.
All right,
David, let's wrap this up nice now.
Yeah.
You got one more question? If you don't have a question, then read the question Sam's got.
Yeah.
We got to wrap it up.
One more. What are you throwing it for?
I'm not asking that question.
One more. I'm not even going to get mad. I'm not going to yell. But we got one more. We got time for one more. Just read the question, and we're out of here.
I'm not reading that question.
That's all we got to do.
Let me see Sam's question. Look. Read Sam's question.
It's probably not even that bad.
It's pretty bad.
After the other,
well, it's not my,
after the other
it's
three.
Bad. It's not my question. I took it off of David. David has a bunch of questions on index cards, right. So
no,
I just grabbed
one. That's pretty
bad.
I'm not asking that.
I would say that one.
One more.
David, that's the good one. Trust me.
One more. Let's do it. I got to go.
It's a pretty bad question.
Just ask it, we'll go. I won't get on you. I already.
It's the same type of question as all the others.
Listen to me for a second. I already told you. What I did for you was like a test, and it's a test of character.
Right,
not a right. Now listen to me. Don't talk. There's no right or wrong answer. Whether you asked her or not, it wasn't
point.
A right or wrong. It was a test of character. Mm-hmm. So I saw what you had done. It wasn't a bad thing. I'm kidding. She has a good sense of humor. She could take questions like that. She was laughing and everything. She's nodding her head. So don't feel bad about it. Let's ask the one question. We'll all get out of here smiling and happy. The audience loves it. Just finish up with this question.
It is fun.
Let's
it does
go.
Make a good point, this Anthony.
Look Let her rip.
Look her in the eye.
Let her rip.
This will be the final one.
Come on.
Okay.
We'll finish strong.
Okay. I don't know. Should I? I don't know.
Just ask it. It's okay.
I don't know.
No, you should. Of course.
It's fine.
Yeah, you should.
She's got
what's
a good
that?
Sense of humor.
Jimmy was just fucking around. He's just fucking with you.
Yeah,
Jimmy
took the bad one away.
Yeah, Jimmy,
Jimmy
took the bad one away from you.
Just do that, we'll leave. It's 11:17.
Jimmy took the bad one away.
I gotta go.
Showing a little responsibility. You know, go ahead.
Okay. I gotta go.
What's the most dicks you would stick in your fart box?
Holy shit. I can't believe you fucking did it again. Dude, just because I changed my tone with you doesn't mean you fucking read the question like that again. You are an idiot.
You're a puppet.
You're not supposed to read it. It's a rude fucking question to the girl. You failed again.
Look how nice she is.
Not read it. You're supposed to not read it.
And you're going
to
keep on telling me to read it.
No, I might, but you don't fucking read it.
Hold on. You know. Oh, okay.
Now, this question was rude. Now, this is the question that you don't ask. Now, read this question, but tell her that this is the question they wanted you to ask it to her, but she knows that you're not really saying it.
Yeah.
And this is the question that they wanted me to ask
you.
Yeah,
yes. All right,
yeah,
but I'm not going
to. Yeah, yeah,
okay.
yeah, yeah.
If you had to compare your Okay.
Yeah.
If you had to compare your clit size to everyday household items, what would you compare yours to?
Oh, my God.
That's the one that was... That's that one.
That's that one.
He's asked her. Yeah.
All right, listen.
No, I didn't ask her.
Another rude question to our guest.
David, why don't we do this? Why don't you apologize to her? She's been very nice.
I know.
A good sport. And apologize for all the wrong...
Yeah, because, David...
You did here.
I mean, you really have been...
I want a sincere apology. Yeah.
You've been rude. you haven't stuck to your guns.
Mm-hmm.
You've just been awful.
Go ahead, David. Apologize to me.
No.
Trust me.
I just want to say I'm sorry for asking you those questions. I apologize.
David, what questions, really?
All the questions that I just asked.
Which ones? I don't remember.
All four of them.
No, which ones?
Here's one of them.
What's down there? What's down there?
No, I'm not asking that.
What is it?
No, you don't have to ask that. Just
I'm not saying that.
What?
No.
Come on. What?
If somebody who
what the fuck now you've gone too far.
If
then you. I'm not asking.
No. That's different than Sam.
That's why is fucking, that different than Sam?
Because it's
material from Jimmy.
Because. 1, 2, 3.
That's right.
That's what you're talking. The holy fucking trinity.
It's not a question.
It's the holy trinity.
I'm not saying a statement.
Who did I say was bigger than Steve? I said you could make fun of Steve because who liked you?
Well, nobody that works here. Oh, I think it's a dumber.
Go ahead. Read.
Yeah. Just do that.
We're not reading it.
It's from Jim Norton.
I know it's from Jim Norton.
Comedian.
It's not polite. It's even worse.
Actor.
It's even ruder than the other things that I just
said. You owe
asked.
Her an apology. What's wrong with that?
I told her I'm very sorry.
That's not sincere.
I'm very sorry for the questions that I asked.
No.
If Jim Norton handed me something.
You're a very nice woman. I didn't mean to do that. I apologize.
Do what?
Ask you all those questions.
All right, you want to play games? Here we go. All right.
To ask you all those questions. I'm sorry about that.
Are you going
to
read the one that Jimmy gave you?
No, I'm not going
to
read it.
That
polite.
Means you're going to have to read
I
this one
my
instead.
Lesson. I just learned my lesson by asking those four questions that I shouldn't have. I learned my lesson.
Test the character.
Wait, what were the four questions you asked her again? I forgot.
What, there was this one?
Yeah, there's this one.
No. We're doing radio. You can't just show me.
I read them already. I'm not reading them anymore.
I feel that I tried to help him amend things, and he would not do it. So now, I love you, but you have to be punished. Please.
Okay.
There you go.
Read it.
Oh, no. Oh, my God. Whoa.
David, you said you have to.
Why do I have to? What if I
That's
don't
That's the main guy.
Well, then, you know, have fun.
It's different. I'm not even going to say anything. That's fucking Jimmy Norton, though. Yeah. That's what Jimmy fucking Norton.
Just go ahead.
What if I don't do it?
You should do it.
I'm not going to do
it. You'll be demoted from executive intern.
Okay, fine.
You don't want that.
I do want that.
You don't
That's
want
a resume
that.
Stuffer.
No,
David.
I want that because I learned my lesson not to ask those questions or say anything rude.
You're not
going to
be an intern.
David, trust me.
They escorted Earl out of here the other day.
It's not me. This is Jimmy.
I wouldn't steer you wrong.
This is Jimmy. Look, I'm out of it.
I won't get in trouble.
I'm backing up.
I learned my lesson. I'm not going to do it.
David, I'm a fan. I wouldn't get you in trouble. I like you. I like you on the air. I wouldn't get you in trouble.
Like,
Jimmy,
the point
not
is
me.
It has nothing to do
I'm
with
done.
Who it is. The point is that I learned my lesson.
So just go ahead.
Can we get Master Joe in here to escort David out of the off the premises?
Okay. I learned the lesson. I'm not going to ask the question.
Yeah, that's not a question.
I'm not going to ask questions or say statements anymore that are offensive. I just learned
that's
the lesson not to go by any
Well,
that,
it's
people.
A compliment, actually.
That's not a compliment.
It certainly is.
Yeah. How?
Just trust me.
I'm not saying anything.
Yeah.
Jimmy asked you, so I'm out of it.
I'm
Don't
asked
worry
you.
About
I take responsibility.
So now it's a whole nother ball game. It's a whole new ball game
I'll
with
take,
Jimmy.
I'll take
we just had the,
Where's your card?
David, I'll trust me. I'll take responsibility.
You gotta show you the door. Whole new ball game
okay.
with Jimmy.
All right.
You don't want to go.
I do.
You don't want to go.
I do. Over that, yeah. I just learned my lesson not to say those types of things anymore. Comments, questions that are rude like that.
Why?
Because they're offensive. It's rude to say those things.
I'm
to
not
people.
Offended.
No, yeah, because it's not towards you.
Well,
ask the audience if they're offended. They're the.
Why don't you read that to the audience
yeah,
and tell them that's
this.
What I wanted you to say to her, and they'll give you a judgment.
Once you
if
ask
it's too
them,
rude, then you don't have to say.
Jimmy
it.
Makes
good
a good
idea.
Point. Read the question. Well,
it's not a question. It's a statement.
All right,
exactly.
Preface it. Go. Hey, audience, would this be considered rude? And then
yes,
and then read.
And she's
that.
Gonna hear it.
So what? She's an adult.
She's there.
That's a good. It's a valid
there
compliment.
Is.
You're too sensitive.
You're
nope.
talking to the audience. Talking.
You're overly sensitive to this
David,
stuff.
I learned my lesson.
Dave,
no, you didn't. You didn't because
I did learn the lesson. Yes, I did.
You didn't.
David, the audience is a good barometer.
I learned a lesson because I listened to
listen
you guys.
Listen to me. You're gonna learn something here. You go, hey, audience. Would this be considered rude and inappropriate? And then read it. That's
yeah,
all.
You're asking the audience.
See, in that okay. way, you're protecting yourself.
All right.
Right.
All right.
To the audience. Ask him.
Or you can face Sam.
Well, I'm going to face
Go ahead, ask him.
Okay. It's not a... Okay.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Preface it by talking to the audience.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey, guys, or whatever.
Hey, guys. Would this statement be rude if I said this statement to her would this be rude?
Okay.
All right, I want your guys' honest opinion. Would it be rude?
All right.
I was, I'm told to say, to, in order to apologize to her and make nice with her for all the rude things that I would say, would it be rude if I said to her, nice scarf, cunt face? Would that be rude? Would that be rude?
Holy shit. Again, he buckles.
Say?
Again, he folds.
What do you guys say?
He folded again. You stuck to your guns, you took your headphones off, you did everything you should have done besides leave. You should have fucking left instead of said something like that. Cunt face, that's terrible.
It is terrible, I agree.
Yeah, well, you said
it. I have an apology written for you on the back. You should at least use the apology real quick.
What's the matter, we're not professional enough?
Yeah, the apology, make nice.
Yeah, read the apology, go ahead. Go ahead.
I shouldn't do it.
Yeah, read the apology. Go ahead.
It's even ruder.
No, it's not. It's an apology. Good, quickly. Good,
I'm serious now. It's getting late. I want to get out of here.
Come on.
Come on. It's Friday.
No, I'm not reading that.
Read the fucking thing.
Come on.
David,
apology.
Don't be a pussy. Read the goddamn thing. You're being a pussy.
Trust me.
I should walk out.
You don't want to walk out.
You don't want to walk out. You're on this. You're part of the show.
Yeah, you're on air. That's
you don't want. The last thing you do is walk out.
You
don't walk out.
You walk out, they won't let you back.
Look, Earl walked out. Look what happened. All right.
Yeah.
Come on.
Quick apology.
Read the apology, and then we go home. Read the apology. Bam, we hit the button and we're out.
I'm not reading it.
We gotta go.
I don't care.
How can we want to apologize to? That's kind of rude.
David, let me read it first. I'll make sure it's okay.
It's not bad.
You already said her scarf,
yeah,
you know, cunt face, and
David. That's easy.
You know, that's nothing.
Worse.
That's nothing. Oh, God. That's nothing. That is literally nothing.
That's,
come on, you don't want to be escorted.
Like Dr. Phil is here.
You don't want to.
David,
I do want to go.
No, David, that's
you don't want to be escorted out. Come
yes,
on.
Yes, I do.
No, you don't.
You're learning a lot about radio today.
David, this is a learning process for you, and you're doing very well. No, you got to learn how to.
Dave, you got to stay on air. You got to stay.
You're not learning.
You got to stay on air.
You are learning the opposite of what we're trying to teach you. This is bizarre.
What if?
No, that. But
hold on, I got an idea, guys. What if she said it's okay for you to read that thing?
All right, that's good.
That's only fair.
I really don't care.
She doesn't care, David. Jesus, if that doesn't make it easy,
if she doesn't care, then okay.
Then it's fine.
All right,
if she doesn't care, then okay.
All right.
All right, fine.
Go ahead.
Apologize.
All right, I'm sorry, whore.
Oh, Jesus. You were going to leave, too.
What?
You're fucking despicable. Get the fuck out of the studio. Get out of the studio. Get out. Get out. Get out. Get out. Leave. Get out.
Boo. There goes
the
executive intern, David. Oh, my God.
Jesus Christ. He's going to have a fucking nervous breakdown.
3 o'clock in the morning, he'll be sitting there just talking to a lamp in the dark. They told me to say it.
Should I have said it? I don't know.
I hope you guys had fun, man. Thanks for just showing up today. We got to get the fuck out of here. Start our weekend.
Weekend, right
Thank
now.
Thank you guys for coming.
David's mental abuse was brought to you by DirecTV. Call 888-961-DIRECTV. That's 888-961-DIRECTV. And I want to thank the cute little girl from Philly for being a good sport.
Thank you to you. Thank you to the nurse. Thanks to the crippled pasta guy from Canada.
Right.
Thanks to the fucking Verizon tech.
Yeah.
Who knows nothing about cell phones. And thanks to the fucking sociopath in the back with the odd hair and the fucking wider neck than his head will support. His head is too small for his neck. It's bothering me. Apparently he fucking pissed off a witch doctor. And,
I think we're going to have to do this
again.
Thank
the guy with the sweater here who owns limo company, Mamaroneck.
Yeah, oh, Mamaroneck, sure.
Mamaroneck.
Heard that word way too many times.
Oh. I know, it's great.
Anything else? Because we're out.
We're done.
Everything good?
We're done.
Let's out.
All right, bye, guys. Have a great weekend. Ron and Fez, new to three.